But enough of this palaver. Let's get the show on the road.
Let's do it. What I've been singing over and over again, I'm just going to drive Jimmy nuts. I'm sexy and I know it.
Why?
Because that damn song is catchy as all hell.
Oh, the M&M commercial got you.
The LMAOSF guys. I'm sexy and I know it.
Is that the M&M's commercial for the Super Bowl, right?
I'm sexy and I know it.
But that's all I know. I'm sexy and I know it. I'm driving my wife nuts. I'm sexy and I know it. Give me another lyric so I can sing a little more of this.
That's all there is.
Is that it?
There's this and Wiggle Wiggle Wiggle.
I'm sexy and I know it. She's trying to talk to me about serious shit. I'm sexy and I know it. Why don't you like this?
I don't dislike this.
No, you kind of did the first time we brought it up.
What I kind of dislike is these. This is a good club song, but I just hate guys that show up and think the party started.
Oh, yeah.
You know, anyway, I hate guys that show up with partying wrapped around them.
Well, didn't we say, like, you're at a party, but the party really hasn't officially started until the official party guy has arrived.
Yeah.
I'm sexy and I know it.
Yeah, this is okay. You like this, Sam?
Of course Sam likes this.
And I know it.
Come on. Come on, everybody.
This has everything that makes a good club song.
Yeah. I don't even know the last time I was in a club.
Check it out.
Good morning, everybody. I guess we're doing Grim in the Morning today.
Yes.
It's Grim in the Morning. Do we have our Grim in the Morning sweepers today? It's me and James P. Norton. I saw the artist, Jim. Me and you all about checking out the latest shit out there. You got a copy of this too, right?
I'm halfway through it.
Wow, man. It's up for a million awards, but no one's going to see this film. And I know that's going to piss off Roland for saying that, but I don't know if, like, the masses are ready to sit down and watch a silent film.
Yeah.
But people that really enjoy film in general will love this.
What I've seen of it, I actually liked. Like, at first, I was like, what the fuck, man? I didn't know it was a silent movie.
Right.
I'm fucking 10 minutes in. I'm like, they're showing a silent movie. I'm like, all right, cool.
Yeah.
And then I'm like, oh, no.
Yeah.
Oh, fuck.
Yeah.
And then I watched Meryl Streep's movie instead.
But I'm thinking, okay, if it's a silent film made in 2012, eventually they're going to, like, have some kind of twist. All films have a twist. Hate to tell you, Jim, not much of a twist. It's a silent fucking movie.
Silent movie.
And you know what? I think I'm confusing people. I really enjoyed it, but I just think, in general, people aren't going to, like, you know, run out to the theater to see a silent movie. Hopefully I'm wrong.
Who is she? Because I have a tremendous crush on her. She's a...
Has she been in other flicks?
I'm sure she has, but she is beautiful, man.
Yeah, she's beautiful. I don't know. I don't know her name.
It's interesting to watch, to see, like, this is how people watched movies.
Yeah,
and for that, but then again, I'm used to silent movies because they always play at the Cellar, when you eat up in the Olive Tree,
right.
There's a giant screen that just shows Chaplin films.
Yeah, I've seen the Chaplin with you over the years, but it's really well shot.
It's gonna win a lot,
and they don't even have a lot of words on the screen.
Right, Cromwell's nominated too, I think.
Yeah, for what?
I'm guessing Best Actor.
He's just a driver in the movie.
Is he not nominated? I'm sorry, I thought he was.
I don't know. Is he? I'd be very surprised.
I could, you know what? I might be.
Anyone could
wrong.
Have done his role. He's a chauffeur.
Then maybe I'm making a mistake. I'm thinking it was.
Might be the lead guy.
Okay, maybe. Yeah.
Who I hear is a comedian somewhere else because I've never seen the guy.
What's
before.
His name?
His name is. I don't know. I'm not prepared.
You got it. Should be on the box.
Yeah. It's Jean. Oh, yeah. Dujardin. Dujardin.
What?
He's definitely
he
nominated.
Is. I'm sorry. Okay.
Yeah. He's nominated?
Yeah, definitely. He won. I think he won the Golden Globe.
Yeah, he's great because, you know, his facial features, he has to have good facial features.
Right.
Because, like I said, it's not one of those silent movies where you have to read a lot. You don't have to read much of anything. John Goodman's amazing.
Yeah. It is actually, when you're talking about it, you really do get kind of roped in even though there's no...
Yeah, I wasn't bored. I liked it a lot. You know, and the music keeps it going, the little piano and stuff. Yeah.
Diddly, diddly, doo.
Twiddly, twiddly. Yeah. I'm sexy and I know it.
Who's that girl? What's her name, Sam? She's really cute, man.
I think it's Berenice Bejo. B-E-J-O.
I'm going to guess Berenice Bejo.
Yeah.
Bejo.
Buenos Aires.
Holy shit, she's so much hotter in that picture than she is in the movie.
She's gorgeous.
Wow. In the movie, they kind of make her look like she's from another era.
Is she? She's married?
Oh, yeah.
They're always married hot chicks.
Why do you look at a hot chick and go, I hope I have a shot at her?
You know what? That's a good question.
You don't have a none of us have a shot
but
at
no,
her.
But no, I don't know why. That's a good question.
But it bums you out when you find out they're married?
It's for some reason, everything goes back to me being a zilch, so that for some reason her being married is a confirmation that I'm a goose egg. It's just silly.
I love it.
What's her personal life? Go down quickly. Where was she born?
What's her personal life?
Buenos Aires.
Yeah. I guess I'm a romantic at heart.
Yeah. I think deep down, Jim Norton wants to be settled down. With a nice gal.
I don't know, maybe. Oh, she's born in 76.
76 is 26.
Oh, she's older than
36.
I thought.
She's 36 years old. Wow, I'm really good at math. Extremely good at math. Yeah, she's... what other movies has she been in?
Two kids.
And she's been living in Paris since she was three.
Really?
Sure.
You can't be dealing with that Paris shit, Jimmy.
She's lovely, though.
That'll drive you nuts.
She's in A Knight's Tale, but mainly Parisian movies, French movies.
Yeah. You know Malcolm McDowell's in this movie?
Yes.
He's in for 3 minutes.
I saw him sitting there when he was sitting.
All right, so you saw a scene. I think that's his only scene.
Wow.
I think that's pretty much it for Malcolm McDowell.
I wonder if a couple people did it because they just wanted to be in a silent movie.
Yeah, yeah. It's the Weinstein Company who, they treat us real well. And like I said, I like the movie. I'm just being honest. I don't know. This is a brave move on their part. To put out something like this, well acted, well done. How it was shot was really, really nice.
Yeah, the camera work is amazing. And if I put it back on, I turned it off because I just wasn't ready. I didn't know it sounded like.
Right.
And what I watched, I liked a lot. The time I turned off the second time was because I had to. I think I had to leave.
Maybe
I'll finish it.
Maybe someone who knows more about films than I. Why did they have to have silent films? Why couldn't they figure out the audio part?
That seems
like it would be the easiest part. Because they had, radio before TV. So why couldn't they have talkies?
Or sync them up at the same time? I don't know.
I'm sure it was a syncing issue.
But why is that an issue? It seems like something they could have...
They used to just play, a record or something with the movie at the same time. Yeah, it's different speeds.
And they couldn't figure that out, the dummies that came before us?
Not at that time.
Yeah,
why
you
not?
You
weren't recording sound at 24 frames.
Were they missing a part of their brain back then when they were growing up?
It's a developmental thing.
I also wonder if the film was shot at a different speed that wasn't conducive with natural speech and lip movement.
Yeah.
Because you ever see Chaplin move? He's all over the place.
Yeah.
Maybe that film speed, but talking looked weird.
Our ancestors couldn't figure out to slow down the film so it looked like what we're used to, and they couldn't figure out talking. I don't get it.
Well, they did. They made talkies.
I know, but I just... They should have figured out a lot sooner is what I'm saying.
It's amazing how actors back then didn't think talkies would catch on.
Right.
You always resist what's new. It's crap.
Mm-hmm.
How would you not think that people wanted to hear the dialogue?
Yeah.
Right.
I would love to be in one of those meetings. No, never. No, no one wants to hear it.
And now you put in a silent movie and you're like, oh, no.
Because we have sound.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Silent movies were wonderful. They do convey good emotion. When you watch Chaplin,
right.
He got a lot of emotion across.
Yeah, The Artist did just that. I liked it. I really did. I liked it a lot. But I was very just uncomfortable because I've never sat through an entire silent movie before.
And you have to look at the screen. You can't zone out because anything that's happening, you're not going to hear. So you can't be on a computer or whatever.
I zoned out a little bit.
Did you?
Yeah, I checked Twitter and stuff. Because when a silent film, the storyline is so basic, you can actually tap out a little bit.
Yeah, it is pretty A, B, and C.
Yeah, absolutely. It's an A, B, C type of movie.
She's pretty.
She's beautiful. But she's no Upton. That's my new one. The Upton broad. She's going to be on the cover of Sports Illustrated swimsuit, I think.
Upton.
Yeah,
Kate Upton?
Yeah, Kate Upton.
How do I know that name? Where is she from?
She's starting to become pretty fucking big.
Who is she?
She's a natural beauty with big natural boobies. Yeah, this is my latest right here.
Look at the way she's laying like she's in the front of Quincy's boat.
Yeah. No, but she doesn't have that flat ass. Look at that.
Wow.
Nice,
she's like a
right?
little bit of a gut almost, but in a nice way.
Yeah, that looks a little gutty.
It's nice.
But I don't mind that shit.
No, I don't.
I don't mind a little. That's not gutty.
Wow.
That's the one right there.
She's wearing a little checkered or whatever bikini, little hearts on it.
Right.
She's a lovely girl.
Want to see if she's married?
Nah, because even if she's not, I don't have a shot. The actress, maybe.
Wow. Yeah, exactly. It's all about Kate Upton, I'm telling you. Supposedly Mark Sanchez and her are, I don't know, doing something. Mark Sanchez.
Ugh. Well, you know, the athletes get that, man.
I just don't want Mark Sanchez to have her.
They can have anybody they want, and they just always... She has, like, boyish hips. Besides from that, she's very pretty.
Yeah, there's no, like, shape to the hips, right?
No, you always try to find something about them that's not perfect so you can realize, like, me not having them is okay.
Right. Look at that. You can't because you're looking at your radio.
That's hot, right?
Yeah, she's really juicy. Except her hips are boyish, I'll say that.
How was Daryl Hammond yesterday?
That was good. He was,
Fucking bummed I missed that shit. I had to do some things.
He was a very interesting guy. I mean, I've known him for so many years, and I didn't know any of that stuff about him.
Really?
I had no idea.
He kept all that hidden, huh?
Yeah, nobody knew.
He was cutting himself. He was doing drugs, drinking. Drinking is the worst part with him.
Yeah, it seems like that brings out the beast.
Yeah.
I didn't ask a few questions I wanted to ask, but there was no reason for it. It was just because he had... I think he had to leave earlier than we thought he would because he had TV switch.
Oh, really?
He's doing a lot of press, yeah.
It was a quick interview?
No, it was... How long did we have
about
him?
We had him for about a half hour. We were supposed to have him for like 45 minutes.
Yeah, 45 minutes to an hour. He came in at like 7:50, 7:55, and we were getting the rap sign at 8:22 instead of 8:45.
Did he tell the story where he was set up in the Bahamas?
Yes.
Holy fuck. That story in the book was really good. He says, do you believe him?
Sure.
He said some guy was bothering him at the bar to do a little coke and stuff, and then he went to the bathroom, and the guy followed him into the bathroom, and he just kept harassing him, so Daryl finally said, all right.
Yep.
And grabbed what, a dollar bill or something that had coke in it?
Yeah, it took a little bit. It's probably how they set people up there for big payouts to the police.
Right.
That's all. I mean, yeah, I definitely, because if he, at this point... He would have just said, yeah, I was buying coke and I got busted.
Right, and then Daryl leaves the bathroom and you know, the police are there and they arrest him and they throw him in a shitty, shitty cell in a shitty situation.
I mean, yeah.
And then his father finally bails him out, flies down to the Bahamas. Did he tell that part?
Oh, yeah.
And then his father basically said, you know, I will kill all these people.
Yeah, started planning his trip back.
Right.
And, you know, and Daryl said, because he's a soldier, that's just how...
Right.
He didn't talk as much about how his father's a tough guy, man. He was, but he wasn't just saying, I'll kill them. Like, dude, he would say that to people, like, you know, if you do that, I'll kill you.
Right.
But not in a way that you say it, but like a genuine way, like you're going to be dead if you do that.
Mm-hmm.
And he's apparently a very frightening dude.
Really?
Yeah, I forget what example. What example did he give early in the book of his father said?
He would kick down doors and punch holes in the wall. I remember that.
There was some phone call he got. Where he called.
Oh, shit.
Do you know what I'm talking about?
Vaguely.
Where they were going to kill the pet or something?
Fuck, yeah. Daryl's sister's pet?
Oh, the dog napper took her or something? Because the dog had... The city came and got the... Whatever it was, the right. Local dog catcher.
Right.
And they were going to put the dog down, and he called and threatened the guy.
And basically said, you do that, I will kill you.
Yeah,
I'm not thinking about it. I will do that.
I'll murder you, yeah.
Yeah, I'll murder you.
He grew up in a really weird household, Dad.
Boy, did he.
Really
boy
weird.
Boy fucking did he.
She was awful, right?
Yeah, but I would have loved to know more. But it seems like how he wrote the book, he blacked out a lot of stuff. Blocked out a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
And it comes back in flashbacks.
That's creepy, man. The fuck, I forgot to mention to him the place in the park where he was just in the park crying and bleeding. His penis was bleeding.
Right.
So his mother had probably done something to his penis.
Yeah, what was that about?
I don't know. I don't even know.
Wait, that might have been the part where he hinted that she poisoned him. Because wasn't that the same thing where he had a bloated belly and all that too?
No. This was in the park. He was in the park.
Yeah.
It was like one of those weird...
So she must have cut his penis because she was all about cutting him. She cut his tongue.
That was, to me, the scariest scene in the book. Because he's being helplessly held.
Right.
Trying to be calm. While she jabbed his tongue. And
right.
He said it bled all over the place.
And he was just a little kid.
Yeah.
Being a father, man, that shit just fucking... I can't read or watch that shit anymore. I can't imagine that shit. That someone would do that.
Yeah, it's upsetting.
Holy fuck.
His book is called God, If You're Not Up There, I'm Fucked.
Right.
And, It's really good, man. Very, very easy read. I was done with it. I actually made myself stop reading because I was like, it's too good to fucking.
Oh, really?
Through. Yeah. Give myself a few days. Let me finish it.
Right.
As
I blew right through it. 3 days. Three easy days for that book. Is that Upton dancing?
Yeah, this is her famous YouTube video for doing the Dougie.
Doing the Dougie? What's the Dougie?
Oh, man, look it up, Eric. Teach me how to Dougie.
I don't know what the Dougie is.
You don't know.
Yeah, she's pretty cute, no?
Why did that get 3 million views?
Her doing she's just dancing. She's hot, and she's doing the Dougie.
Yeah, why does it get 3 million? Because she's hot or because she's doing the Dougie?
It's both. It's a cultural phenomenon.
Ah, the Dougie?
Oh, yeah. Teach me how to Dougie. Teach me how to Dougie. Ugh.
By the way, me and Mars are very excited.
Yes, sir. Why? Because you talk to him?
Well, you teach him how to Dougie?
I still haven't told him that I had an extra ticket for the Knicks game the other night.
Yeah, you don't want to mention that.
I didn't realize that, Mars. When I was trying to find someone to go with, I didn't think you'd go to basketball, Jimmy, or I would have asked you.
No, you're right.
I had an extra ticket for the Knicks game, completely blocking out that our own Mars is a big fan.
You're a basketball fan?
He's a huge fan.
And yep. He's told me over the years, and I just forgot.
You're a big Knicks fan?
Yes, I am.
Who'd you end up taking?
I ended up taking Stupid Sam, who doesn't know anything about who doesn't know anything about basketball.
That really hurts, man.
Carmelo Anthony was knocked off the game. I didn't know who one other person on the court was.
So you don't know the guy that was bringing up the ball all game.
Sam's excitement was about Carmelo Anthony because he went to Syracuse with Carmelo Anthony. That's his connection to basketball.
Did you know him?
No. We were freshmen at the same time, but he was a celebrity there.
And then I'm at this game, and within minutes, Carmelo Anthony goes out with a groin injury. But as I'm sitting there, I'm looking at the point guard going, holy, what did I say, Sam? Because now everyone's talking about this kid.
Yeah, you said he's the only person on the court who actually knows how to play basketball.
Yeah. What I've noticed, because I haven't gone to a game in a while, a lot of the NBA guys, they don't have skills. They don't have fundamentals anymore. Right. They know how to get the ball in the hoop, but it's very, very different than when I was playing basketball and when I was really watching a lot. And I'm sitting there, and there's this Chinese kid. He's 6'3". He's from Harvard. And I'm like, who the fuck is this guy? No one was talking about him, I swear. I even have a tweet that is ahead of all the press he's getting. And I kept saying to Sam, I just want to watch this kid. This kid is unbelievable. What the fuck? Well, who is he? Where did he come from? I don't know anything about him. His name's Jeremy Lin. And they're already talking about how he's like a Tim Tebow guy. He came out of nowhere. At least Tebow had a great college career. Played for Harvard, which isn't known for being a powerhouse basketball school. I mean, they're Division I, but they're in the Ivy League, and they kind of just do all right. And then he's not drafted in the NBA, plays a little summer ball. He gets a little attention. The fucking Knicks pick him up literally last week or 2 weeks ago. I just learned today. He's living on his brother's couch on the Lower East Side because he has no money. Not only is he living with his brother, he's living on his couch because his brother doesn't even have an extra bedroom. And he's now the starting guard for the New York Knicks.
He was the star of the game, and like we said when we were leaving, his picture wasn't anywhere. His jersey wasn't for sale anywhere. Nobody knew who he was.
I was so into this kid.
Wow,
after one game. They're talking about him everywhere, Jimmy. That's why I'm bringing this up. Everywhere. He's on the front page of the sports section.
I did remember you mentioning him the other day, too.
And I'm walking out of Madison Square Garden. I was so into it. I was like, you know what? I might buy a fucking Jeremy Lin jersey or something. They don't have shit on this guy because he came out of nowhere.
He had a monster game last night, too.
Yeah, so the Knicks have won 3 in a row. He's the point guard. He's scoring over 20 points a game. That's insane.
Yes, and 10 assists last night. That's great.
Hope he doesn't turn into a Hideki Arabu. Couple of good games, right? And all of a sudden,
Well, Opie said it. He does a lot of good things besides just scoring and passing the ball. He penetrates. He
knows how to play. Yeah. Like, I haven't seen a guy like this in a while. Yeah, sure, you got your old school guys that are still playing, but no one knew. I don't see fundamentals like this. He knows how to drive toward the basket and dish it off at the perfect time. Mm-hmm. It's unbelievable.
You should have seen him live.
And he played again.
Amazing.
Yesterday, he played against one of the top point guards, right?
Oh, really?
Yeah. The guy from Wizards, the interns were telling me.
But anyway, they make him the starter, and the Knicks have won 3 in a row, and the Knicks have their two main guys out right now, too.
Carmelo Anthony, who's the other one?
Stoudemire's brother died in a car accident in Florida.
Oh.
Yeah, his brother has always been in trouble, was in jail and shit.
Oh, that sucks.
I don't know what was going on in Florida, but he died in a car crash, so Stoudemire's out for a while. But I know we don't talk about basketball much on this show, but this guy, I'm telling you, you'll see his name yourself out there. Jeremy Lin.
He had a dunk last night, too.
Yeah. He's a 6'3 Chinese guy.
6'3. Wow, that's small for NBA.
Yeah.
That's really short.
But very tall for Chinese.
Yeah.
If you see the replay of the dunk, everybody moved out of his way. No one wanted to be the highlight reel.
Really?
Yeah.
So, is that why?
Yeah. You don't want to be part of the highlight reel.
But I just loved how he played. And ask Sam. I was obsessed. I just kept going, this guy is unbelievable. Who is he? I was looking at the program. I was Googling. I'm like, who is this guy?
Yeah, he was all you were talking about. He was all that anybody was watching.
Yeah, you just don't come out of nowhere like that, especially in basketball. You just don't.
6'3 is really small for the NBA.
It's, yeah.
Dude, that's, and Jordan was 6'6, and a lot of, I think Magic was 6'6.
Yeah.
He's
a point guard, though. So, I mean, point guard. Yeah, he's probably an inch short for a point guard, maybe 2 inches at this point, right? But
wow.
Mm-hmm.
Did you like the fact that we had Kareem in here the other day?
Oh, yeah. That was nice.
Did you say hi to him?
No, I did not.
Why?
Why?
I don't know. You guys, I don't even want to bug him.
All right, Mars, could you move back to the couch?
We'll
making
it.
Everyone uncomfortable.
Wow.
Just wanted to make sure everyone knew I didn't invite you to the Knicks game.
It was a good game.
I forgot that you were a Knicks fan, even though we've talked about it over the years. I apologize.
What was Sam doing throughout the whole game?
He was watching.
He had to just listen to me talk about the...
I was learning. Yeah. I didn't know these things.
Yeah, so...
You know, each basket is worth 2 points. Who knew?
Oh, Jesus Christ, Sam.
But then sometimes you'd see that the 3 points, and you go, why is that one more?
Because it's from more far away. Yeah. He got 3 points. Hey, 2 points.
Seth in Illinois is mad. Of course Derrick Rose has fundamentals and skills. I'm just saying in general, because now everyone is jumping on my fucking case.
Right.
But, I mean, if you watch enough basketball, you realize a lot of these guys don't have the fundamentals of the old guys. You know, they're good players. Maybe the game itself has changed. I don't know. But, yes, Derrick Rose, of course, fundamentally sound. Seth, relax. Speaking of Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, did you see our pictures and how shitty they are? Because of the lights, once again, in the studio.
They look a little...
A little dark, right?
Yeah. Although, did you use a flash or not, E-Rock?
Yeah, I do, but...
E-Rock takes notoriously blurry pictures.
Well,
E-Rock.
Well, I'll tell you what E-Rock wrote me. He goes, you and Jimmy, man.
You have a curse when it comes to certain photos.
I want to find the text, because he goes, you and Jimmy don't do well with black guys.
Oh, yeah, it's...
Because of our skin tone?
Light. Yeah.
That's not a bad picture, though. That's not a terrible photo. You have an individual shot.
Whoa.
That's
you fucking sent me a low-res picture, you asshole. The one I tweeted didn't look like that, or is that my page?
Your tweet.
That's your...
The best part of that was watching you realize as you said it, that could be my...
Wow, is something wrong with my phone? It didn't look that good on my phone.
That's not a bad picture.
E-Rock, sorry. Jesus Christ. No, the other one. Show him the other one, though.
The one of you and Opie.
It's horrible, and I'm so bummed. I've been waiting my whole life to get a picture.
Let me see. I don't know if that's that bad, dude. It's fine.
Trust
me. That's not that bad. It's not blurry. That's not bad at all. All you got to do is you take that. You can easily light that a little bit. That's not bad.
You know what's funny?
That's actually a decent shot.
I really believed growing up that I had a chance to make it to the NBA. That was my thing. I played 8 hours a day as a kid. I went to all the basketball camps, all that shit. I was a gym rat. And then you fast forward and you get a picture with Kareem Abdul-Jabbar and you go, what the fuck was I thinking? How the fuck can I be on the court at the same time as this guy?
Yeah.
He's a foot and a half taller. And a few people have told me since the interview that there's always been rumors that Kareem Abdul-Jabbar is actually taller than 7'2". But just hated the fact that he was so tall that he actually knocked his height down a couple inches. There was always a rumor that he was taller.
It was
because we all remember Kareem Abdul-Jabbar is 7'2".
Two. It was off-putting when he walked in. Like I was telling somebody, your mind. It's when you're sitting and the guy of that size walks in, it doesn't look right. Like it looks like he's being carried or he's on.
It's unbelievable.
Floating. It's odd to see a man that long.
Yeah, I felt like I was like in the middle of a freak show or something.
Yeah, it was weird watching him duck just to come into the studio.
Yeah, he ducked through the door more or less, right?
Yeah,
he's as fucking as royalty and athlete as you can be.
Oh yeah, he's one of the greatest of all time. But I said that, and then people had to go, he's not even on my top five. Who would you put at center? Who would you put at center?
He's not in your top five.
Like, that's a lot of guys had to say that. Yeah. But I think a lot of guys just have to be dicks all the time.
I mean, yeah, it's hard to take a top five in anything. Like,
but all right, who's a better center than Kareem, stats-wise and championship-wise?
And points-wise.
Who? Give me one.
Olajuwon? Was Olajuwon a center or no?
Well, Olajuwon doesn't come close. You might argue Bill Russell, but you're not going to put Shaq in your number one.
Chamberlain?
Ooh, Chamberlain. How many championships, though?
I don't know. I don't think he didn't have Magic around him, though. Yeah,
you know, that's a fair argument. Wilt the Stilt. What is Sal the intern saying?
Ewing.
Oh, no.
What?
He's in there. E-Rock just put it in my headphones. He's in. Even I knew Ewing.
Patrick Ewing?
Ewing.
Yeah, he's putting Ewing on it. Abdul-Jabbar level.
Patrick Ewing.
That's what he said, Sal.
You know how I used to be a massive Knicks fan, and Patrick Ewing pretty much took that away. The frustration of that guy. He couldn't get a fucking championship for New York. He came out of college as pretty much the best player. And he had the supporting team around him. He couldn't get the fucking job done. He was a bust. Holy fuck, Sal.
Yeah, Sal, that was a dumb choice.
Explain.
Why Patrick Ewing is he's on your top five?
Top five centers of all time.
Crazy. Oh, my God, you're crazy.
How am I crazy?
Wait, there's Bill Russell, right?
Bill Russell would absolutely be there.
Will Chamberlain.
Absolutely.
Abdul-Jabbar.
Absolutely. You have to put Shaq above fucking Patrick Ewing.
Shaq. I put Shaq above, yeah.
And then you could argue a bunch of people before you.
Who played for was Laimbeer a center for the Pistons?
Nah, I think he was.
Who played the center for those Vinny Dumars and Isaiah Thomas? Who was that? Wasn't Bill Laimbeer?
I thought Laimbeer was a power forward. Was Laimbeer the center?
I think so.
Oh, okay.
I thought he was too.
Right, David Robinson.
Olajuwon played the shit out of Patrick Ewing during the.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah.
Always played him tough.
I forgot about David Robinson. And what about
Moses
Karl Malone?
Moses Malone, there's a million of them.
Was Karl Malone a center?
Yeah.
It's like a power forward center. Like,
yeah, he'd switched off.
Chamberlain?
We said
Chamberlain, yeah. He was unstoppable. But I say Ewing because, I mean, what he did for New York basketball.
He did nothing. If you don't win a championship, you've done nothing in the end.
He played
a lot of people wasted a lot of money.
Yes.
But he did nothing.
It's true.
If he walked away with one championship, then he did a lot for New York basketball.
He always played against Jordan in the finals, it seems. And the conference finals.
I think we made the finals once, right? That was it. We made the finals once with Ewing. He played for New York for 15 years, I believe. Something like that.
Yeah.
He did nothing.
I'm sorry. I'm just too much of a
Willis Reed is a better center than fucking Patrick Ewing as far as Knicks centers go.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah, you're wrong.
Stand by your convictions.
Well, no. I just love
Ewing.
I do like Ewing. I love that whole era of basketball.
You think
too.
Kareem was overrated with his 38,000 points?
No, I don't think he was overrated. But.
And half of those was with a weird fucking shot that no one else could do since.
Yeah, people forget that's a lot of fucking points.
Yeah.
That's a lot of points.
Yeah, 38,000. You got to stay healthy for many, many years. Tommy from Rochester, will you explain to him, Sam? Ope is a day or two behind on the chink, just saying. And no, I'm reading his tweet.
He's saying...
I said it before it hit the papers.
Yeah, you said it while the game was happening on Monday.
Right.
It was Monday.
They weren't writing about the kid yet.
No.
I even tweeted. You could go back in my timeline. You'll see a tweet 2-3 days ago.
I think he had his breakout game. I think it was that
a day before,
Saturday,
probably.
Yeah.
Right. All right. So, yeah.
But he wasn't being talked about.
Is that
yet.
What that guy's saying then?
No.
That's possibly what he's saying. But who cares?
I was ahead of the media, the mainstream media.
Yes. Again, you're a seer, and people need to. Realized this.
Sean Kemp from the Sonics was great. Well,
Patrick Ewing.
Look, I love Ewing. Ewing was versatile, too. So many centers do very little things. Ewing had a fucking jump
shot.
What
movie was he in?
What movie was Ewing in?
Yeah. Exactly.
He wasn't in an airplane. Okay.
Well, a lot of these guys do
he wasn't a movie, though.
Yeah, they do them. Was he really?
Mm-hmm. Very brief part.
Oh, I thought you were joking.
No, The Exorcist 3.
I'm pausing because I'm reading Jimmy's face.
Patrick Ewing.
I think he might be telling the
truth.
Is
in a dream sequence in The Exorcist 3. He plays the angel of death.
You're kidding.
No. And it looks like, just Google Patrick Ewing Exorcist 3.
Are you kidding?
I'm dead serious. Wow. And I it came out in 19...
Oh, my God.
Oh, he's right.
But take a look at him in it. Just Google it. You'll see that I think he has stitch marks on his neck too. It's about a decapitated
right.
boy.
Okay.
But there should be a picture of him sitting there like in the Angel of Darius.
Wow. That was him?
Good call, Jeremy.
Yeah, he's got wings on. It's in a really weird dream sequence.
I believe he was also in the film Space Jam.
Don't you just read that?
Yes, he did.
No, I don't say I believe.
Yeah.
I knew that it's a basketball movie. Of course he was in Space Jam.
If you have the knowledge in your head already, you could say something like that. But if you just looked it up,
I knew
you
he was in. I've seen Space Jam.
I also learned right now that he was in Space Jam.
Yeah, but that was that phony. I also believe, but he wants to just go look what I just read, guys.
Yeah. The movie was just the say look what I just came read out in 1993.
Fair enough, but say look what I just read, guys.
You're bringing us down, Sam. I know it's grim in the morning, but
I'm sorry.
All right, Sal. Enough about NBA centers.
Exactly. Some fan. You know he's next to three.
If Ewing won one lousy championship, then I would probably have to agree with you.
All right, well.
You know.
Although Marino never won. Marino never won in Miami.
Yeah. Do you put him as one of the greatest quarterbacks of all time?
You have to, without a doubt.
Why is that? So why don't we do that with Ewing? Ewing, I just felt like he should have won at least one, if not two championships in his time in New York. He had the supporting staff.
I think Marino is a better football player.
Why didn't he ever win a Super Bowl, you think?
I don't know. I think that Florentine, you know what? Florentine will be exact. Here's why. And he'll have like the exact answer. I'm guessing because the running game wasn't that great, so everybody knew.
Right.
And maybe the defenses weren't as good.
Maybe the defense was weak.
Yeah, but I also think their running game, because Florentine would go fucking bananas about their play calling.
Right.
He used to call the fucking people in the back of the thing saying Shula was doing a good job.
Well, Florentine's coming in a few minutes, so we'll have to ask him about that.
Yeah, I'm interested to know that.
So Jeremy Lin, just want to bring that up.
Yeah.
Because, it's an incredible sports story. He might be a bust. Maybe this is just a quick week where he's great, but I don't know, man. If the Knicks have a point guard, though, we're in good shape. We're in good shape.
I'm so bad positionally. Like, I don't know. Like, what does the point guard do compared to the forward? Like, I just know that they're
point
running.
Point guard brings up the ball and is the playmaker, basically. Sets up all the shit.
Yeah, I never know. Even in football, there's a lot of them. And I've been watching my whole life. I don't know what a lot of the technical.
And then you usually got, like, kind of a shooting guard that kind of hangs out on the perimeter. You dish it off to him. He shoots. Forwards are down low a little bit. And then the center is your guy. Get it way down low.
I'm sexy and I know it.
I like basketball. I just don't watch it anymore.
I don't know. After watching Jeremy Lin, I might just... I'm not going to lie. I haven't been a Knicks fan in a while. I've kind of let that go. But when they got Stoudemire and Carmelo Anthony, I started taking a look again. And now with Jeremy Lin, holy fuck. New York has something to be excited about, finally.
Yeah.
It's been a long time as far as basketball goes.
I would go to a Knicks game, but... I think I went many... I went years ago. I saw the Lakers lose to the Nets many, many years ago. I was in high school.
Who was playing?
Oh, Jabbar or Magic.
You saw Jabbar?
Yes. It was when I graduated class of 86, or dropped out that year. So it was 84, 85.
Wow.
And the Nets won the game. And I remember being in a mall with my buddy Deion Jackson. And he was I don't think he was ever tall enough to play. But he was a young guy. He might have played in Italy. But everyone thought he was going to go pro. He was...
And he was from your high school?
No, but he was one of my closest friends. He was younger than me. But
was he tall?
Yeah. He moved to Plainfield, New Jersey. And his uncle, Tyler, who was like a couple years older than him and me, and, you know, we were very close. And he was kind of a basketball prodigy at that age. And he was in all the basketball camps. And we were in a mall, and he saw Skywalker, whose real name is Kenny Walker.
Mm, sure.
Who played for the Knicks. And... I was like, oh, man, I was at the game this year and you guys beat the Lakers. But it was the wrong team. Because
it wasn't the Knicks.
No, it was the wrong team.
Did you feel awkward?
I felt very stupid.
Whatever happened to your friend?
I believe he went to play in Italy. I think that's what happened. We lost touch, and his uncle was my closest friend growing up, who I actually just got his phone number. I've been meaning to call him. I don't know. I would like to catch up and find out how he is.
Maybe your friend is, like, the greatest European basketball player of all time or something. You don't even know.
I don't know if he's still playing or not, or if he went on to coach. Someone told me he might be coaching or doing something else. I don't. Maybe he had an injury. I don't know.
He could have been playing in his 40s. He could have made it.
It's hard to believe that he's
39 or fucking 40 years old, because he was the young one.
Right.
Like, we would hang out, and he was 14 or 15. We were 17, 18. Right. Fuck, man, he's almost 40.
I used to love basketball. That was my first love. Holy fuck. All right. Speaking of sports, I have nothing to do with this, because this is going to lead to a lot of bitching, which I'm trying to get away from, Sam.
I understand.
Oh, is this more on this theme of can't believe who had tickets to what event?
Yeah. Yeah, the Super Bowl thing is still happening. Getting more and more info. The Super Bowl diss, as far as I'm concerned, was a massive game changer. I don't respect this company, and I don't fucking believe anything Scott Greenstein tells me anymore. We really got fucked over as far as the Super Bowl goes. And it goes against everything he's told us since we've moved into this building, that we're important to the company and we want to get you guys out there. We want to, like, get you into some high-powered events and really up your profile. And then the Super Bowl comes around, and we were completely shut out. Completely. And then we're learning that, like, just dummies got to go. I mean, dummies that don't bring the amount of subscribers we do. Simple as that.
And we don't mean Covino and Rich, by the way. We like those guys.
No, they should have been there.
Yeah, they do a good job.
They should have been there. You know, the people they sent, sure, I guess they should have been there, but we're bigger than all those shows. And we're even bigger than Rosie, who now has a problem with the company and how she was treated with the Super Bowl. Because then it turns out that some of the people that did go, oh, by the way, all the people that did shows for SiriusXM, most of them didn't get to go to the Super Bowl.
Right.
They went down there, broadcasted, and had to, you know, get back on a plane, because it was way more important to get, you know, management and salespeople, you know, really good seats than the talent. That's where we're at with this company. Like, the talent is certainly not the most important part. It's management, it's sales. Those guys are really important. And talent, believe it or not, even though there's a content company, they're shit. They're looked at as shit.
No.
Salespeople's assistants also went to the game. But Covino and Rich couldn't go. I don't think Sway had a ticket. It's a game changer for me. It really is. There's nothing these guys can say to me that I'm going to believe anymore. Yeah. So then Rosie went, and we're a much bigger show than Rosie. She's a bigger name, but we bring in way more fucking subscribers than her.
In the radio world, yeah.
Way more. But they thought it was important for her to be down there. And not us, which is really strange if you think about it, because what the fuck does she know about football, and what the fuck does her fans know about football? I bet you she doesn't know that much about sports. And she talked about her Super Bowl experience, and she is fucking pissed off. You want to hear some of this audio?
Yes. This is from her TV show, by the way, on OWN.
Oh, really?
Yeah, she was just annoyed at the whole thing. Like, she had to... She does this... her TV show is an interview show, but at the beginning, she does, like, a...
What do you mean it's an interview show? Isn't it... Didn't she take Oprah's spot on OWN?
She changed the whole format of it.
Oh, because it wasn't working.
I guess. Because now it's...
I don't even know where that show is.
Is OWN in trouble? I think it is.
It seems like it.
It's having a very hard time, because you can't find it. No one knows where it is.
I know. Why is that?
It's
done. You're right, though. Because I used to watch a little bit because of Eric Logan, and I just can't find the fucking channel.
Oprah is Oprah, but it's no matter who you are, if people don't know, it's like Conan. Excuse me. Oh, God.
Ooh, Flemmage.
Excuse me. Sorry. Excuse me, guys. I just spit into a napkin, but it's like you can't swallow that stuff.
Lung butter.
Yeah. Oh, God, that sounds terrible. But, like, who did I just mention?
Conan.
He's having trouble on TBS, but a lot of it is because literally it's just not where people go every night. It's not on your rotation of clicks, and you don't know what channel it is.
Right.
But there's been things I wanted to find. I'm like, what the fuck?
Right.
With 150 channels, you literally don't know. And it's not like, instead of OWN, they should call it channel 289. You'd know at least where it is.
You know what? That's a really good point. Really good
point. These things are.
It's a different channel on every
cable
service. Digital, so you really can't find it.
On cable, on fucking on Dish Network or whatever.
Why is it that we just know what channels we want to go to and that's it?
Because there's only so many places. Like HBO, I forget what channel that is. I have to go into my guide and I look for the logo in the corner. Like I don't look for, HBO used to be 14, I think, in cable. But now I just go to and look for the picture of the HBO logo.
Oh, okay.
And it's like, I don't find a lot of things for that reason. If they didn't bunch HBO and Showtime and all that, I would have no idea what the other fucking movie channels were.
But the younger generation's coming up, and they don't even bother that shit. They find their shows online and say, fuck going through the TV to find this shit.
They need to figure out a way to make, you know how, then again, you know what, the networks aren't the same either. I was going to say Fox is not Fox 5 everywhere. Fox is probably different in Philly. It's 10, I think, right?
I think so, yeah.
And it's 5 here, so.
Affiliates.
Yeah. All right, well, Rosie on her talk show for OWN was talking about her Super Bowl experience.
She starts the show, before she does the interview, she does just like a, she just talks into the camera. There's no studio audience anymore, so it's just her talking into a camera.
Why is there no audience?
I don't know. She does the show without an audience.
There's no audience.
No, she sits across the table from somebody and does an interview.
Oh, that's going to fucking not work.
And she starts the show. It's weird. I kind of like it. It's different, but it's just
but
her.
But that's not going to work.
Talking into
it's
a
like
camera.
It's like Joe Franklin.
Yeah, she's a stand-up.
So like, but she's making jokes, but there's no laughs.
But she should do her little monologue. She should fucking interview a guest. Then she should do her silly shit that made her famous on TV.
Because that's going to seem like doing jokes alone like that. It's going to seem like a cable access show.
Yeah.
Instead of, she should have an audience. No, she's a comic.
No one's going to beat Ellen DeGeneres. She's a monster.
Is that Rosie's old spot too, right?
I believe she, more or less, I think she just allowed Ellen DeGeneres to develop her fucking talk show.
Why did Rosie leave? Does anybody know? Because she was a fucking, in that spot, she was the biggest one.
Because she's a schizo.
Rosie used
psychopath.
To have the spot that The View has now.
Oh.
She, well, at least in New York, she was on at that time.
How long ago did she leave?
It's been at least 10 years.
Ago, yeah.
Wow.
It's probably 10 years.
Turn of the century around there.
Yeah. And then she comes back with, and she does, she's not soft anymore.
Yeah,
like, people accepted her on TV because she kind of was soft. I think everyone knew, even though she didn't tell the world until after her talk show, that she was a lesbian. But she was just, she was soft, if that makes sense. Now she comes back, she looks like she doesn't even fucking shower for her own show.
Yeah, plus all that 9/11 stuff, that really annoys people.
Yeah. But she had a lot to say about SiriusXM and her Super Bowl experience. And I was trying to move on from this, but Sam goes, you got to play some of this audio. You have to.
Just because she's talking about the company publicly on a big TV show.
Right.
Not a big TV show. No one watches it.
It's OWN.
Well, there's a lot of people very disgruntled around here.
Yeah.
Disgruntled.
Disgruntled. Excuse me, Jimmy. And someone's got to do something about it. They just have to. This company's going to collapse. You can't pay just one fucking guy and just let everyone else just rot. You can't do that.
And I don't know why they would send Rosie. And again, it's not to shit on Rosie, honestly, because she is a genuine fucking big-name celebrity. But why would they send her and her family to the Super Bowl? Like,
they got her family tickets?
Yeah, because they didn't want to pay her. So
they got her family tickets?
They sent her and her family.
So some adopted kid had my fucking ticket?
To the Super Bowl and gave them all tickets to the game in exchange for doing shows for free.
You know.
That's what Rosie said on her show.
Oh, okay.
You know. You gotta be shitting me. Seriously? And we had to sit in New York and do just basic, not lame, because we're good at what we do, but just dumb radio shows instead of doing, you know, a big Super Bowl show.
Yeah.
Now I'm mad all over again.
Yeah, it's
unbelievable.
It's frustrating.
Here's Rosie.
Sirius Radio asked me if I would go and do this big radio promotion thing for them and talk to all the.
Well, that's good because we weren't asked to go, or were we? I guess we were.
We were.
We never heard anything about it.
You were asked if you wanted to go, not if you would go. And you said yes.
Not only because we could be a little negative at times.
No. Don't put yourself down like
that. I gave a very triumphant, excited, yes, I want to go.
But they didn't want to subject you to Radio Row.
Because then I guess, you know, I got to blame Greenstein in the end. Like, I'm sure it's all in front of him. Like, okay. Who do we send to the Super Bowl? I got 100 tickets or whatever the fuck he got. And then I would assume he would make the final decision. And somewhere along the way, he just forgot about us or checked, you know, or X'd us off the list.
And can I, when something like this happens, like, all right, whatever Howard's deal is his deal. He's suing, there's, you know, whatever, they're having a public dispute. But Rosie is a big name, and then she's on her TV show saying, hey, look, they sent me, and it didn't go well.
Right.
It's like two of the biggest names you had, even though she's not as big a name in radio, but she's on television.
Right.
That almost undoes all of the effort you put into developing this person as a part of your platform.
Right.
When they're on a bigger medium, which is television, even though her show is not, and fucking saying that you didn't treat them right. It's like,
right.
Do you understand how
Yeah.
You don't want people going on TV saying that you're not treating them right.
And then here we are, and we're bitching and complaining, you know? And there's a lot of people around here that would do the same thing, but they're scared. They're scared to do just that. They would love to. I get people coming up to me all the time like, thank you. You're saying what needs to be said. Oh, God, I wish I could say what you guys say, but I can't.
There are a lot of people in this building that really like these breaks.
So there's obviously a problem down the hall. And who's going to take care of that?
For them and talk to all the people at the Super Bowl on Friday. I said, okay, what are you paying? They said, we're not, but we'll get you tickets. You'll bring your family. It'll be so much fun. I said, okay, great. I never asked where the seats were.
So they send her and say they're not paying?
They said they're not going to pay for the show, but we'll give you guys a great time at the Super Bowl.
But they didn't want to subject us to radio. Here's where it becomes a little difficult to buy that. I'll play devil's advocate. They didn't want to subject us to Radio Row. But she's, in their eyes, much more important than us. Let's be honest.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's because Scott Greenstein, I'll say it, doesn't give a fuck about actual radio guys. He cares about names. And it's all about hiring names that don't even have to do radio shows.
And they care.
Rosie O'Donnell is not going to get you subscribers in the end. She's going to get you a little bump up when you sign her, and that's it. And a lot of those people will go away because they realize, oh, fuck, you know, I can't, you know, invest in this shit.
Yeah, people don't really sign up to listen to celebrities that they don't know from the radio that they can also watch on TV. Like, no one's going to go, oh, we got to go listen to Rosie because she's not a radio. Howard, I can see. Here, yeah, I get it. Mm-hmm. Like the Opie and Anthony show. You understand what I mean? It's like no one's going to go to even Oprah. She might have brought some people. But I don't think as many people are going to rush to listen to Oprah talk for an hour a week.
I would love to know how many people Oprah brought to this platform. You'd be surprised.
Yeah.
I bet you that was a big fucking bust.
Just because.
Especially when you factor in the money they had to pay her. You know, they were hoping she was going to mention it on her her big TV show when she was still on. She mentioned it like once for like 5 seconds.
Yeah, kind of a bare minimum.
She didn't want to mention it. What does that say?
But if you get someone like Rosie, and she is on, and she's on TV, and you want it to be a cross-promotion that kind of strengthens the platform when getting free TV advertising, then you kind of got to treat that person really well
right.
when you send them to what is the biggest sporting event
right.
on Earth,
yeah,
at least in this country.
And then, you know, yeah, they send her to the Super Bowl like she's just some midday jock from fucking the Midwest. Because that's how you treat shitty radio guys like that. Like, oh, yeah, we're going to send you to the Super Bowl. We're going to put you in a shitty hotel. You're going to have to fly in, you know, in storage. You're going to have to hitchhike to the fucking game, but you're going to go down there, you know?
So where were her seats? I have to hear this.
Oh, here we go.
I have to hear this.
Because on the whole, the people at Sirius Radio have always been great to me. They always get me nice seats. It's, you know, you don't usually ask is what I'm saying. Right? Why look a gift horse, or in this case, an employee, in the mouth? All right. So my kids are there. We do the show. It's really fun. I met Tim Tebow, and I met Clay Matthews, who I called Chris Matthews, which was kind of embarrassing, but he was lovely. Tim Tebow, also lovely. Jenny McCarthy was there. Jordan Spark. It was a great time. So Saturday,
that's
I
cool.
get home. And
great. What did we do those days? Looked at each other.
I think.
Smelled Jimmy's fucking gas.
I cut gassers, and Voss came in.
Yeah.
And I think.
Yeah, that's
Sam's foot we talked about, and E-Rock was here. And
yeah, that's way better than sending us to the Super Bowl. Jesus, I this is a game changer. I don't know what's gonna happen, but I can't be like I can't do this anymore with that asshole. The guy doesn't fucking get it, and then he lies to our fucking face. I can't do it.
So Saturday, I get home and the phone rings at about dinner time, and my assistant Tanya. Says, it's the people from Sirius Radio. They got you two seats, and they want you to take them. They're in the camera range, and they think it'll be a little bit better for you. I said, what do you mean two seats? I have the kids here. I would need the four seats. And they said, well, they didn't think the other seats would be so good for you. So, well, how bad could they be?
Her adopted children got our seats. That's what the company thinks. We'd rather give... fucking Rosie's kids Super Bowl tickets than Opie and Anthony and Jim Norton.
But even when that was done, it wasn't even four seats together.
By the way, I'm a fan of adoption. But
you are?
Yeah, but from a comedy standpoint, just makes it hurt a little more, I guess.
You say adopted kids.
What were you saying?
Yeah, they didn't even, like, give her four seats together. If they were going to go ahead and give her your seats, you might as well let her sit with her kids.
Yeah, it's kind of hard. Because Rosie is famous enough where she, like, I'm a cat. Like, if they wanted the gym, look, your girlfriend's going to have to be in the locker room servicing gentlemen while you, I'll be like, okay, as long as I'm on camera, okay, because I'm a fucking zero. But when you're Rosie, the idea of the camera panning to you means nothing to you.
Of course.
Because everybody in that stadium knows who you are. She's that famous. I mean, she really is.
By the way.
So being with the kids is what's important to her.
She's never on camera.
To then, I don't remember them flashing her at all.
No, of course not.
She didn't end up sitting in that section.
Oh, really? All right, it continues.
Here's the deal with the Lucas Oil Stadium. On the floor is level one. A little bit sideways, level two. Above that, level three.
Nice.
Past that, where the time clock is and what down it is, and the that would be level four. Above that is level five, and then so far up that you'd have a nosebleed would be level six. I was in level 5+.
Holy shit, this company. Why don't they want to take care of talent? I truly believe we're bigger than Rosie as far as, you know, radio goes. But she is a name for this company, and then you just treat her like shit. I guarantee the sales assistants weren't sitting in level 5+. What's wrong with that guy? What is wrong with that guy? He's on another fucking planet.
And the way Rosie said it was like, we're sending you here. The experience that you have here is what you're getting instead of a payment.
Right.
So, like, what you bring to us, this is what it's worth. Some seats up in
Where's
the
500. Where's 5+?
It's all the way up.
Yeah, I'm just trying to figure out how bad that seat would be.
Part of me would say she's being unrealistic because, look, four seats is a lot of comps at the fucking Super Bowl in good but... That's a lot of comps. Like, when we do UFC, Dana loves us. He couldn't love a radio show more than this.
We don't
we get a couple right there. And it's not because he doesn't like... It's because there's it's hard to get those.
That's a great example, by the way, because we don't even work for the UFC, and they treat us better than this place.
Yeah.
Like, Dana calls us up, hey, you guys want to go? You know, I got a local event or whatever. We're like, fuck yeah. And next thing you know, we're pretty much ringside. We're right there.
The best seats that he can possibly give us, he gives us. I mean, they're always amazing tickets. But I've had my tickets split before, and they're like, look, there's not. I'm like, don't even. It's great, fine. But the tickets that they give, like the other two people I'm with, will be, say, 30 rows back in the first row. They're still great seats.
This is how shitty we are. Rosie had 5+, as she's saying, 500+, whatever. Horrible seats at the Super Bowl. We didn't even get to have that choice. That's how shitty we are.
But if you're sending someone of her name down there and you're saying this is what you're getting paid.
Right.
You got to realize if Rosie wants to do a live appearance somewhere, she could probably pull in $150,000 easily.
Mm-hmm.
You can't give her tickets in the fifth. If that's her payment, you got to give her four great seats. You have to. Because the amount of money that she can make is sickening.
We got a guy that sat in 5+ on Sunday. Richard? Explain the 5+ to us.
5+ is section 5, which is way better than section 6. And, I mean, the seats are fantastic. I mean, and there's nothing wrong with that. There was only 6 rows in section 5, okay? And in section 6, which is above us, it was like 20 rows. So section 5 is a good thing.
Section 5 is the orange section. It's almost
well, I'm
the
looking
top.
At a map. I don't know why you would call them fantastic.
They're not.
She's probably used to being... Again, dude, you...
But look at all that room between the field. There's a million different colors before you get to section 5.
Dude, sir, your idea of good tickets and her idea of good... And I'm not shitting on you.
Right.
But she's Rosie. She's used to getting the best seats available. Like, she's probably used to being in the owner's box.
Right.
Pun intended.
Right.
You know, these are terrible seats.
In all fairness, to someone like Rosie, it's a big-time slap in the face. It's a huge slap in the face that someone would assume that you'd be okay with sitting, you know, in the 500 section.
Unless they tell you...
Of her caliber.
Unless they tell you before you go down, like, look, the tickets were impossible to come by, they're not the greatest seats, and we're going to give you four, but to get four together, if you tell someone that going in, that's different.
Yeah.
Did you enjoy the game, sir?
I sure did.
Are you a Giants or a Patriots guy?
I'm a Giants fan.
Okay, well, congratulations.
All right,
but especially when you have kids, like, you can't say the day of, we're going to have to separate you, and two are going to be in the camera section down here, and then because, another two are going to be up in the 500.
Let's get the clip played.
Because the experience, by the way, is her and her kids are sharing it together. Mm. She doesn't seem like she gives a shit about the Super Bowl.
No.
As a sport, it's to do with her kids.
Right.
Like, so far up that you needed a telescope with the binoculars. Like, honestly, and no one to sit with me and to help me, possibly with people who might recognize me. My normally efficient assistant, Tanya, who does not do anything wrong ever. She took the brunt of my anger, and the guy on Sirius Radio who I called screaming at him at the top of my lungs, which is really such wonderful behavior that I'm proud of. He said, no, well, I'm sorry, but I thought you knew. Well, when I gave the tickets to your assistant, I said I hoped we could do better. I said, do better? Do better? That's like there might be a little rain for the tsunami. Do better? I have my boy there. He has a broken collarbone, Blake. He is in a sling. I didn't want him to get jostled. I thought we would just get right in, get right out. You know, honestly, you get spoiled as a celebrity in America. You really do. They usually take you in a car right to a venue. Someone meets you there. Hello, Miss O'Donnell. Hello, children. Hello, fiance. Off we go. We sit. We watch. We leave. Very easy. Now, I've got two good seats, and I've got the rest way up.
Yeah, you know, she makes a good point.
That was very honest of her to say that, too.
Yeah, that's I appreciate her honesty on that. We're not even in the game because we're not even invited. And I believe she was talking to Scott Greenstein, who's one of these guys who just likes to schmooze his ass off. And you never have a normal conversation with a guy, and you don't even know what's right or wrong anymore when you talk to the guy.
Something like that is she's used to that VIP treatment. And what the problem is when you see how it, like, I'm always amazed at a much lower level. How I get treated by Leno, just by being there, you treat it so well. You treat it so nicely. And like, oh, we're so happy you're here. It's almost a culture shock because I kind of don't feel that in a lot of situations here. You know, I mean, I feel like they like me, but you can't take someone like Rosie, who is really used to fucking being treated really well, and treat her like she, like you said, like she does a fucking midday show in the middle of Oklahoma somewhere with 10,000 listeners. You can't do that.
Well,
she says she's going to go on TV and bash you.
There's someone here that thinks that's completely acceptable, obviously. Yes, let's continue. A couple more clips from Rosie. What?
He said it on the air, I guess. Zito from Ron and Fez went.
Yeah.
As a sales assistant, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah.
He was in the 300s.
Yeah. Yeah.
They gave Rosie tickets in the 500s.
So isn't he pretty much an intern?
Zito, he's new hiree or whatever.
A new hire gets to go. When
it's now Sophie's choice. I literally have to say, Vivi, Michelle, Blake, I'm going to just pick one of you. And the other ones, good luck up there. What can I do? If I picked Vivi, then Blake would be forever scarred. If I picked Michelle, they both would hate me. And Michelle, I didn't know what the hell to do. So after screaming and yelling, they got me two other seats, like in section 3 or 2+. So here's what we decided. You know when you're on a plane and you're not with your kids, you could go ask the nice people, could you possibly trade with me because my child? And normally people will say yes because they see the kids with you. I get to my seats, my 3+ or 2+ seats, which were not horrible, but not what my kids or I were used to. I'm not trying to complain because I was happy to be there. I'm not saying I wasn't happy to be there. But this was a little bit of a barter agreement. Come and work for us for nothing, and we will give you the time of your life.
Yes.
At the Super Bowl. In the top level.
and to me, I think that's where they screwed up, because with a person who makes the kind of money she can make doing a gig, you can't take a fucking $150,000 a night act.
Yeah.
And say this is your payment, you can't do that.
And thank you, Glue Glumen, I guess, from North Carolina. Whatever. You got it for Sean from New York City. Sorry. His feedback's flying by. Greenstein posted photos showing he was in level 1, according to Stern Show Baba Booey.
Really?
Greenstein was in level 1. Where's level 1?
Level 1 would be near the field there.
I guess he's really important around here, this Greenstein guy, huh?
Well, the NFL channel is on. Excuse me. Serious. So, yeah, I'm sure all upper management here is probably very connected to the NFL, also to Major League Baseball, just because of the they do a lot of business with the lawyers.
You want another clip?
I'd love one.
Some people are mad that we're bitching again, but it's an ongoing fucking thing.
This is an ongoing thing.
The Super Bowl. We're trying to move past it, but more and more info is coming out.
Yeah. Rosie did it.
They handle this horribly.
Show.
Right.
Okay. So we have to get to the Super Bowl. The people from Sirius Radio said you should leave your hotel with at least an hour and a half to spare. We got in the car at 4. We were dropped off outside of the stadium at 4:09.
Is that true? But the Super Bowl, in all fairness, it's been notorious that you can't move around at all.
Yeah, you kind of got
it. It has been notorious.
She must have had a great hotel.
If we're going to keep it fair.
She's got more, though, to the story, yeah.
If we're going to keep it fair, I've heard over the years that even just going a mile in a car could take well over an hour when it's Super Bowl time.
At the stadium at 4:09. Took 9 minutes. I thought we were outside the stadium. Apparently, we were in a neighboring state. We didn't have the pass to get through to get dropped off, so the limo guy drops us, and then we have to walk 30 minutes to try to...
For the assholes that don't want to hear this, seriously, and I don't give a fuck, I really don't in the end, go find another stupid channel to listen to.
Wow.
This is classic.
Wow.
This is fucking classic. It says so much.
A half hour.
Because like I said, I'll say it again. We do a much better radio show than Rosie O'Donnell, but she's a big name. The company has pushed her forward as a big name for SiriusXM, and this is how they treat her. Wow. She had to fucking walk for a half hour?
A neighboring state. That's kind of like a reflection
on
how
out of shape she is?
The people couldn't have looked and said, all right, it's Rosie, like, let her, like, you know, because she's going to get bothered.
But see, she was just thinking, I'm best friends with Madonna, and I'm walking a half hour to the stage.
Because the company didn't have the proper passes?
They didn't have the passes.
You think Greenstein had to walk a half hour?
I would assume not.
Who knows?
I wouldn't think
so. I'm just asking.
Who knows?
I wonder.
It wouldn't surprise me if whoever was setting it up butchered everybody's setup.
So she's like, oh, look at this. Nice. I'm at the game in 10 minutes.
A limo, by
nine
the way,
minutes.
Too. The limo dropped them. So they gave her a limo, at least.
9 minutes.
Without passes.
But they don't have the pass to get through, what, like some kind of barricade. So
right.
It's a half-hour walk.
Mm-hmm. Can I guarantee you they said, look, Rosie's in the car. And some fucking indie cop was like, fuck, well, I don't give a fuck who's in that car. Yeah. It ain't going through.
And I guess, sure, I've been known to bitch a bit, something I'm trying to work on. But the reason I'm playing this is it just makes a lot of my fucking points. Carolina, man, this is amazing. Loving this. Yeah, of course it's amazing.
Walk 30 minutes to try to find our way into the stadium. You couldn't see the stadium from where we started walking. Again, not complaining. Very happy to be there. Really, it's a wonderful life. Kumbaya, my lord, kumbaya. Do we have to pay for that? Is there clearance? Anyway.
See, she's like...
She's a stand-up. That's you need an audience for that shit.
Yeah, she's way more political than us.
Yeah.
She's trying to say I was happy to be there and all that. That's all bullshit, obviously. You know, she is fucking pissed.
Can you imagine what she was screaming over the phone?
Of course.
It wasn't, of course. I'm grateful for the tickets.
Yeah,
of course.
Wow.
Were there kids there?
See, we didn't even get on the level to be treated like shit down there. We weren't even invited to be treated like shit.
Why did we, Baba, use Gary Delabati Twitter to, he
oh, yeah, yeah, I guess Howard's show was all about this yesterday.
Oh, yeah.
I decided to wear heels. Why? Because they told me I might be on TV if I was in the seat that was close enough, and I didn't want to look schlubby. Okay, so we follow the masses.
She wears heels.
And many of them took advantage of the rule in Indianapolis that you can drink in public with open bottles. Many people were intoxicated. We arrived at what we thought was the entrance, only to find a Disneyland-like habit trail of snaking S's while waiting to get through the scanner where we were patted down. Now, also happening that Sunday, Roseanne Barr announced that she was running for president. Roseanne Barr running for president.
Joke ticket.
Drunk people who are football fans and me in the Habit Trail gerbil line was not a good combination. I had taken a Xanax before I got in the car. Thank the Lord. I'm going back and forth, and the people a little bit intoxicated. Hey, Rosie, Giants! Hi, how are you? You look like Rosie O'Donnell! I am Rosie O'Donnell. You're running for president! Literally, 12 minutes later, I'd run into the same group of people. Hey, you look like Rosie O'Donnell! I actually just met you in the...
They should just be online with all the other schlubs. Just... Walk up to the 500 section.
And no,
with her heels.
Nobody wants to hear a privileged celebrity bitch, but she has a legit point. At least get her to a different line, because people are going to bug her.
Right.
And some people are going to aggressively bug her.
Right.
It's not like they're just going to go, hey, can we take a picture? There's people that really hate her.
It says a lot.
It's polarizing.
Yeah.
It says a lot. It's what they think of talent.
Wow.
Even the one guy that they do, like... take care of is not happy and pissed off.
No.
Wow.
One more clip and then we'll move on.
We got through and we made our way to our seats. We were in section 2+, and I went over to two very cute men who were sitting in the two seats next to the two seats we had, and I asked if they would trade. Okay? And frankly, they looked at me suspiciously. I said, is it possible, sir, that you two would want to go down to the floor level and I could sit here with my children because they gave us seats that are not together? And
wait, she's giving up her good...
You can't ask people to back trade Super Bowl tickets.
Right, right.
She's doing the right thing. She's going, I want to sit with... She's an out-of-the-closet lesbian who publicly adopted children. She wants to sit with her fucking kids. It's important.
Right.
She's family cruises for gay people. She doesn't want to be away from her kids.
Right, so she's giving up the two good seats for...
Sure, a little farther back.
And that's why you didn't see her on camera.
Nah.
Because she probably...
goes for the TV seats.
Yeah, with the rosy seats are probably two guys who are up on domestic violence charges somewhere. I love
it. Seats that are not together, and they eyed me suspiciously and then said, are you running for president?
Oh.
I said, no. Roseanne Barr. I then decided I should take my children out of the game earlier so we wouldn't be in the masses, so that we could get through.
Pause. By the way... this is where the lesbian part comes in. Mm. You don't take your kids out of a game like that early.
Yeah, man.
Rosie, that's a bad move.
Well, that proves my point.
That's a woman's thing.
She doesn't give a fuck about the game or the Super Bowl in the end.
How do you pull anybody?
I would have never left that game.
Who beats?
That game was never boring, and you knew it was going to come down to pretty much the last play.
I don't care if the fucking blimp from Black Sunday is landing at the end of the game. You have to stick. God, that was a much better reference than the guy. I know it's 1979.
Sorry.
No, that's right. That's a woman's thinking.
So that we could get through and get to our car, which, as I said, was parked in Montana. We decide to leave just as the Giants get the ball with 2 minutes left. We get finally down to the base level, and we hear a scream. That's when he threw the pass to Manningham. We watched it on TV. Even though we were at the game, we missed the whole ending part. My son was not happy. His thing was throbbing, and I was feeling like it was a P. Diddy redo. I've started to really have to face myself the way Susie Orman talked about last night. You really have to look at yourself and face yourself. I have to face the fact that I did not get into P. Diddy's party. I had really horrible seats at the Super Bowl. What's next for me, people? Really, what's next? I have to go to celebrity rehab, and I don't mean that horrible show with Dr. Drew. I mean a place where they teach celebrities who are no longer as famous as they once were how to be in the real world.
All right, and that's it.
That's funny.
In all fairness, she should. That was her choice to leave the game.
There was
It but was, she left it, and I have to say, because she's leaving with everybody was going to be a problem for her, where it wouldn't be for us. Or it wouldn't be for any of us.
Right.
But leaving the game...
Yeah, but you just sit there for a while. You're Rosie O'Donnell.
That's true.
You sit. That's what I usually do. When I go to a sporting event and I know the traffic's going to be horrible, I'll just sit for a while. Who cares?
There should have been arrangements for her to get in and out. Or at least have somebody... if the company is sending you... If she said, I'm going to go down there, and said to Sirius, hey... But when they say, look, this is your payment...
Right.
Then that you should be treated... as you're accustomed to being treated, because that's what they're paying you.
Otherwise, your show is valueless. You know what I mean? The value of your experience is what they value your show at.
Right. Well, there you go. That's hopefully that'll be the end of the Super Bowl saga. But we weren't even given the opportunity to be treated like shit once we got down there.
No.
I won't get to go to the Emmys on Sunday.
Why?
When I do a lot of stuff, I don't get tickets for the event, but we'll be outside. Mm. But I know I'm not going to get tickets for the event.
Right.
And I'm okay with that.
Yeah.
You might. They might have a ticket laying around.
They don't. It's the Emmys are a little tight.
That might be a tough one.
Oh, yeah. But, you know.
Okay, we got lots more to do here, obviously. We got Jim Florentine joining the show. We have to talk about Roland Martin, who I've been calling the Black Roland forever. They suspended him, and it looks like they're going to fire him.
Of course. That's glad. Well, I mean, glad is it pushes that, yes.
So we'll talk about what he did. It's all about tweeting. These celebrities are going to stop tweeting. Because now you can get in a lot of trouble because people are just reading your tweets constantly. And CNN, they fired Rick Sanchez.
Yep.
For something he said.
What did Sanchez say that got him?
I don't even remember anymore. It wasn't even that.
Oh, was it an interview with Pete Dominic? He said something about Jews. He said something.
But it really wasn't that bad.
Juan Samuel. Samuel is that his name? He's now on Fox.
Right.
Was dumped by NPR.
Right.
For giving an unpopular answer to O'Reilly.
Right.
So I'm really happy that the media is being bitten by this stuff because they are the ones that made it look acceptable to do.
Right.
So I sound like a hypocrite saying that, but nobody in the media stands up for fucking entertainers. So now, and it's fun to watch them all losing their gigs.
I remember a time when it mattered what you said on the air, and you could live your life off the air, and they never looked at that to punish you. But man has... the times they have changed.
And Florentine is promoting his one man show, which I'm going to Friday. It's here in the city Friday, Saturday, I think. I don't have the details. Jim will have them, but check Jim's Twitter. Oh, thank you, Sam.
Well, Jim's gonna be in here.
The Producers Club this weekend. Go to brownpapertickets.com. Cannot wait to see that. I'm your savior.
And once again, we were right about Greg Kelly. We'll explain that.
Yep.
And I don't know.
Let's kiss.
And we might kiss. Sure. You want to do Black History Month? Let's do that.
Sure.
All right. Florentine joins the program next. Oh, no. Live reads. Fuck. A lot of them. When am I going to go pee-pee? All right.
For Black History Month, the Opie and Anthony Show recognizes some of the individuals whose contributions have shaped the African-American community and changed all of us for the better. Today, we honor NBA great Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan was able to make an impact on the worlds of basketball, baseball, and golf in the way that few African Americans do. However, it was his work in advertising and marketing that truly made him an icon.
Gatorade, is it in you? No. Gatorade, is it in you? Gatorade, is it? Gatorade, is it in you? Are you ready? Gatorade, is it in you? No, don't like that. Gatorade. Is it in you?
Thank you, Michael. It is in us. Stay tuned as we continue to recognize significant African-American contributions for Black History Month here on the Opie and Anthony Show.
Sirius XM. Remember,
I'll always be true. Getting topical today?
Yes.
Hold on, man. We got too much going on. We don't have time to stop the show to talk to sexy. And I'll say,
get in topical.
Hold up! Wait a minute!
With the Sex Man.
Good morning, sexy.
Good morning. We'll make this fast. Beatles' first live American TV appearance on The Ed Sullivan Show 48 years ago.
He's not putting any effort in anymore.
Was this the song they played on Ed Sullivan?
This is the first song they ever played.
On Ed Sullivan?
Yeah.
All right, that's good.
Oh, wow. There you go.
It really is. What do you got on Kareem Abdul-Jabbar?
Yeah, we heard, we had a thing with the...
I'll be honest with you. I got a tweet right here. Puddle of AIDS. Kareem's cunty publicist got his appearance on Boomer and Carton canceled because they weren't allowed to ask basketball questions.
Yep.
I hope people were listening the other day when we went through this whole thing.
KAJ33 is his Twitter name. Kareem was a fun guest, man. He was happy to talk basketball. We covered the book. Apparently, she was yelling in the sound booth, and we saw her really giving Kareem a talking to. That's how you know it's not coming from him, because he didn't shy away. He lit up talking about it.
Right.
It's what he is.
He's one of the greatest basketball players ever, and we're watching him get yelled at by this, like, 5-foot evil woman.
Yeah, little fat lady.
Yelling and pointing at him and basically telling him, look, you got to just talk about the book. You don't want to talk basketball. You don't want to talk about anything else but the book. That is the dumbest advice a publicist could give her client.
She is... And I've heard that he's her only client, and my opinion, I don't think she's particularly good at what she does. She didn't strike me as being good at it, and she's really, if you're gonna cause problems at these places, and you're gonna have fucking Boomer and Carton cancel it, but they're a big sports show here in New York.
Yeah, how do you
serving your client well?
How do you, as a publicist, tell a huge sports show that does mornings in New York City?
Yeah.
Not to ask Kareem Abdul-Jabbar sports questions.
Plus, they have a TV element. They're on the MSG network.
It's a terrible, terrible miscalculation. And I don't know what gives her... Maybe she doesn't know how it works, but I don't know what makes her think that a legitimate sports show is going to tolerate that.
No, of course
they
not.
They get Jeter. I'm sure they get all the fucking... Yeah, they probably get very good guests.
And the book that... Kareem's pushing is self-explanatory. There's not much there. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
To talk about it, I mean. It's basically about black guys that invented shit.
I would like to sit her down
and go... What else can you say about it?
Do you think that a sports show, or this a male-oriented show, is going to just ask Kareem questions about black inventors in a children's book and not... Do you think that any audience wants to hear that? Don't be a dummy.
Right.
What a dummy.
Yeah.
Everyone should tweet him. And you don't have to curse the woman out, but you really should let him know that she's not, or at least what's happening. Because I don't even know if he understands.
I hope he understands.
Does Kareem understand that she's costing him opportunities?
Maybe she, like, keeps him tied up at home.
It wouldn't surprise me.
The only time he's allowed out is when he does these interviews, and he's scared.
You know, I don't
understand. Maybe there's a misery situation happening here.
Dude, I don't get it. I mean, I think he's her only client. I could be wrong.
Mm-hmm. She was banned from the building. That's how much of a twat she is.
She was banned from the building.
And then she basically said, if I don't come to Sirius XM with him, then, he's not going to do the shows.
Yeah.
So they said, all right. And you could tell she's just not a nice person.
She's not at all a nice person.
I really wish we could have confronted her, but we found out most of this after the interview, unfortunately.
And being not a nice person is up to you, but to me, when you're doing things that it doesn't really seem that they serve your client well,
mm-hmm.
to me, that's where you're really fucking up. And if you talk to this, if that's what really happened, if she really said to Boomer and Carton, you can't ask basketball questions. Or if she wanted to pull out a Mad Dogs interview I heard last time she was here. Because she was talking too much about sports and up. And it's like, you fucking dummy. You fucking dumb motherfucker. Or you're ruining the reputation of the fucking greatest center who ever lived.
Right.
Look, maybe it comes from Kareem, but it didn't seem to me like it did.
And in the overall scheme of things, not many people are going to remember the book he wrote in 2012. They're going to remember that he scored 38,000 points in the NBA.
But that's what makes you want to go buy his book.
Right. Work it in.
You
work in the book. Don't worry about it. We're professionals. We know how to do this. You work that shit in there.
But to me, that's a dummy who knows nothing about entertainment and thinks that she's just going to walk in there, talk about the book. Go fuck yourself, fat lady.
Right.
No, you don't know what you're talking about.
Right.
That's not entertaining.
Right.
Look, if she was a good publicist, she would have done research on the show.
Who are you?
I'm sorry.
Just fucking. I know.
No, I mean, she would have done research on the show.
Based on, by the way?
Look, these guys are going to ask personal questions. They're going to get into the sex stuff, whatever they're going to do.
Yeah.
So maybe we should stay away from that show. Let's go on the fucking Z Morning Zoo.
Right.
Because they'll keep it focused. That's all you got to do. Say, that show's not for you. This one is. This one isn't. This one is.
But yeah. We just talked a little sports and all that. We didn't say anything that would have been out of line.
You know, someone like Dave Tyree, that's when you talk about the book, because he didn't have an amazing fucking football career. He had one good catch. You know what I mean? Then it's all about the book. But you got fucking Jabbar, one of the greatest athletes ever.
Do you know how...
Of course you got to talk about sports.
It makes people uncomfortable if you avoid that. It makes people uncomfortable... I would never want to do an interview where I only talked about my book.
Mm-hmm.
I'd want to mention it, get it in there, and then talk about other shit.
Right. That's how it works. Everyone knows that.
Some of these publicists who think that the plugs are everything, you don't know how it works. And if you don't know how it works, you're not good at what you do. You're a dummy.
Yeah, because if the interview's boring, you're losing people. So then when you finally do mention the book, no one's there to hear it.
Exactly. Exactly.
No one's here, you know.
People just like, shut up, click. They don't want to hear it.
They're like, holy shit, they're only going to talk about this book, and they're gonna go away.
How are you a fat lady who's banned? How are you banned from a building that has 20 million subscribers?
It's probably because of the free pretzels in the kitchen.
Roland, does she
ate them all last night.
What the fuck?
She ruined Sway's interview, too.
She ruined Sway's interview.
They let her in. They're like, come on in. I was like, oh.
And then what happened?
They're doing an interview. Like, Sway goes, so my man crammed out of the sky. The book! The book!
She's yelling at
live on the air.
She's waving it?
Yeah, waving, yelling.
My fucking God.
Can we get permission to play that audio on our show?
Let's just play it.
I know they have a problem around here.
Because she yelled at
when you play audio from other channels. I don't know why.
I thought this was one big happy family.
Oh, it's just a terrific fucking happy family, Jim Florentine. Yeah.
And it's a happy family with a Soviet block watch.
What, Roland?
I see her waving the book back and forth through the glass.
Really?
Sure it wasn't a menu?
Here's the artist back.
Oh, thank you.
I liked it, but no one's going to see this movie. Tell Weinstein.
Actually, it's number one movie right now in America.
No, it's not.
I know.
No, the problem is it's really good, but I don't know how people are going to go see a silent film in masses. I don't know. It's a big chance they took. I know it's up for $1 million awards, and it's going to win a lot of awards because it's unique and it's filmed great and the acting's great. But in the end, it's a silent film.
Yeah,
I liked it, by the way, so don't be confused. But I just don't know as far as a movie for a lot of people if it's going to do well.
Yeah.
Oh, all right, Roland. Good talking to you.
Yeah, I mean, that's not, you know.
No, because
I don't know.
Yeah, it's only in certain theaters, like downtown, like the artsy theaters.
Oh, yeah. Because they understand. They're hoping maybe they could get it into other theaters and that people will embrace this. I don't know. I don't know if they will.
That's not a movie you want to watch with your chick. Because you can't shush her when she wants to talk.
Yeah.
Is Sway here, Sam?
Not yet.
Not yet, no.
Can we get him in right before?
What do you mean, not yet? When does his show start?
I think he's in it wherever his office is.
His show starts at 8.
Why? Can we grab him?
Why does he
get he'll come on.
Why does he get to start at 8?
I'll take a look.
No, I'll go look. You stay at the board.
Okay. Why does he get to start at 8?
Shade 45's morning show goes from 8 to 12.
I don't know if Sway's coming in. He might be off to the Grammys.
That's true.
Grammys. Yeah. Did you leave already, though?
I'll find out. Yeah.
He's probably going to the Grammys for MTV, though, no?
I'm not sure. He's hanging
out
to the Grammys,
that's all I know. I'm guessing that's MTV, though. He has a lot of MTV connections.
I was at the Grammys last year for, like, the Radio Row thing.
Yeah.
It was huge.
Wait, there's a Radio Row at the Grammys, too?
Yeah, oh, yeah. There was, like, seriously, there's like, 60 stations in one, like, big, like, convention right next to the Staples Centers, I think it is, or whatever, downtown.
You got to think there's people from SiriusXM going to the Grammys.
Let's find that out.
Oh, my God.
No. I'll say hello to them when I'm there.
Me and Gas did, like, 40 stations. It was great. We just
really?
Like, do they know who we are? Right. I guess there was nobody else there that day. Right. So they just were like, we'll take them, take them.
God, please.
About 60, I would say. Maybe 65.
Please, I pray that no one...
Quad Cities, Iowa? I remember I was on that station.
Yeah, that no one in here is going to the Grammys, please. Oh, my God.
I can't wait to see some SiriusXM signage when I'm there. I'll let you guys know. Believe me, I'll look out for it.
And I want to start this show a little later. When we just can't get that done, and Sway gets to do 8 to noon.
It would be better for the West Coast.
Of course it would. Florentine, we got to ask you about Dan Marino, because we were talking about basketball.
Right.
And we have this kid, Sal. He's an intern. He's only probably 23, 24 years old, so I'm surprised that he lists Patrick Ewing as one of his favorite players of all time. And I said Patrick Ewing was a bust because he never won the championship. So in the end, I feel like he was a bust because I was a big Knicks fan back then. And then someone brought up Marino, okay. And that's in your wheelhouse.
I did.
Right. Why is Marino considered one of the greatest quarterbacks of all time, but he never won a Super Bowl?
Well, Marino was a better... I mean, if you look at both careers, they're two different leagues, but Marino was a better player.
For his sport. Than Patrick Ewing?
Was better than Ewing.
Yeah.
Ewing was in New York, so it's a lot bigger. Ewing was great. I mean, Ewing should You know, he's definitely a Hall of Famer. He didn't win a championship. But look, it's a whole team thing with the championship.
Right. When the Knicks got Ewing, New York lost their shit. They weren't thinking one championship. They're like, holy shit, are we going to have a run of championships now in New York? And he never got one. And he had the supporting players.
It was that guy on Indiana or whatever. Who was that guy?
Reggie Miller.
Killed him. And look, if Romo completes that pass to, was it Austin or whatever, in the Giant Cowboy game in like week 15, the Giants wouldn't even made the playoffs, and who could have been the Cowboys against the Patriots.
It couldn't have been.
It just happens like that. So, but Eli goes in, and the ball fucking goes in the Giants. They recover every fumble. Brady throws an interception, shit like that, and then he wins another Super Bowl. So Marino never had a running game. He only had a 1,000-yard rusher one time, and he had no defense whatsoever his whole career.
Wow.
So he but look, he was one of the best passers. If he played right now, he'd be throwing 7,000 yards a season. Seriously, because they were holding receivers 30 yards down the field.
Right.
They'd still be able to touch him. It wasn't a pussy sport like it is now.
Right. Oh, you're right. The rules have changed.
Absolutely. So he would have thrown 7,000
right now. I forgot about that shit. They would hold jerseys.
Oh, yeah.
Everything.
You were allowed to, basically.
You forget about all that.
All of that bumping and stuff like that. Absolutely. So it wasn't the 5 yards. They weren't throwing flags left and right. So
you think he's over-penalized now?
Well, you know what? The playoffs was and the Super Bowl was good because I think they got...
They let him play a little more.
Yeah, they definitely let him play more, which was good because it wasn't a flag every 2 seconds.
A little bit.
But, you know, it was just so much...
You know, I've trashed Eli over the years, but nothing but respect now. I can't...
Guy's solid, man.
Under pressure, he fucking comes through every fucking time.
He gets
and that pass he made to Manningham is just... I've watched it 100 times. It's amazing. That was a lucky fucking pass.
He gets hit so hard, gets right back up, never limping, nothing.
Think
right
he's better than Peyton?
No.
You think Peyton's a better quarterback
Absolutely.
Still?
Absolutely.
Eli's got 2 Super Bowls.
Yeah, I know, but...
He's been in the league, what, 4 years? 5 years?
Yeah, but...
Is he that new?
I don't know.
He's 8 years. Eli's in.
Eli's already 8 years in?
Yeah.
Holy fuck, where's
the
time
going? No, Peyton's a better quarterback, without a doubt. Peyton's probably going to be maybe the best quarterback of all time.
Really?
Yeah.
Who's he going to play for next year?
Hopefully Miami.
He's done with the Colts.
You think he's really done?
Absolutely.
Why?
Yeah,
they're recruiting the kid from Stanford?
Andrew Luck, yeah. They're moving on from Peyton.
But why are they?
It's just time. They got the first pick, and this guy's a damn good young quarterback. So why not? It's time to turn the corner.
It's too bad, though, because it's going to end badly over there. They should keep Peyton at least another year or two and keep Andrew Luck on the bench.
Let the kid develop a little bit.
Yeah, let him watch under Peyton like Aaron Rodgers did under Favre.
Right.
You know, Aaron Rodgers, you know, learned everything right about being a quarterback, all of fucking Favre's mistakes he...
Right.
Are you happy to see him, that Favre is forgotten after Aaron Rodgers?
It's beautiful. Nobody gives a fuck about Favre anymore. See, that's a problem in Miami. Miami hasn't had a quarterback since Marino retired in 99. So they keep coming back to Marino. Like, we haven't said Marino. And now with Green Bay, nobody even fucking mentions that piece of shit Favre.
Yeah. Do you think
nobody
he's,
cares.
You think he's bummed that no one's talking about him
Absolutely.
Anymore?
Absolutely. The guy's a fucking egomaniac. A miserable fuck. He's on a farm in Mississippi with his miserable wife right now and his miserable life. He wants no part of his wife.
Really?
No. The guy was trying to cheat on him when she was going through breast cancer treatment. You probably don't like your wife.
Right.
If you're texting 20-year-old chicks saying, come on over, here's a picture of my dick.
I'm
really tired from these chemo treatments. I'm going to go to bed early. All right. Click. Hey, here's a picture of my dick. You want to come to my hotel? I've done some scumbag things in my life, but nothing like that. That's fucking low.
Yeah. I would do that, but...
You would do that?
Oh, I'm garbage. But I think it's funny that it's fucking...
go.
No, I do think it's funny that nobody is talking about... He's not talking about coming back anymore, it seems. He knows
he can't. No, because he wanted to come back when the
Bears... He said he wanted to come back, and they
didn't
want him.
Nobody wanted him. They didn't want that drama, man. It's almost like T.O. T.O. Right. could still produce, but there's too much shit along with him, so they don't want no part of that.
Yeah, he was going to come back. He started making some calls, and they're all like, yeah, good for you. Have fun.
All that shit catches up with you eventually, the drama. So that T.O., he's playing an indoor league now. He owns part of the team.
Really?
Is that what Terrell Owens is doing?
Yeah, some like independent league that will fold or whatever. Yeah, that's what he's doing now because he's got 4 baby mamas that he owes money to. And child support and stuff like that. So
why are you throwing your dick juice in women
that?
I don't get it.
Come in their assholes.
I was always paranoid of that shit. Why would you do that?
It's amazing.
Why?
Is that street cred?
I don't know. I don't know.
It, it really feels good.
It does, but, you know, it's good. It feels pretty good taking it out and spraying it, too.
Emotionally, it feels better to spray it because she has to just get up. You have to pretend like she has to that awkward walk to the fucking get a towel so it doesn't drip on the floor.
You don't.
I like to put them through that.
You don't clean up your women?
What?
You let them walk to the bathroom all drippy?
Like a fucking, like a candle. Yes. Of course. Absolutely.
I don't clean. I don't dust.
I don't clean.
I'm a slob. No, but when it comes to my load, I'm fucking right up and cleaning it.
Yes.
I'm not. I'm like, there's a sock over there. You might want to grab that.
I got the towel ready. I throw it on the side of bed. If not, I go to the bathroom and get one.
You're a good guy.
And then I always wash my mule off, too.
You make her get up awkwardly and try to, like, keep it all intact?
Yeah. Fuck yeah. Shimmy on your back.
All right. So if you come on her stomach and it's just there, so what's your next move? You're both lying there. You just finished.
I roll over my back.
She's coming.
What does she do?
Fucking
so she's
amazing.
And that's it.
And she just lays there. I'm like, oh, that was amazing. She, it's either going to dry on you.
Yeah, you don't want.
Or you're going to get up. I don't mention it.
Yeah, you only got about like, you know, a 5 minute window before that shit crusts
up. Yeah, before you're scraping it off with a fucking, yeah, with those things that used to take ice off the windshield.
Yeah, you got to go to your car, your trunk, go get the ice scraper.
Do you think most guys clean up their own mess?
I think
most guys would clean up their own mess.
For what?
Especially if they care about the girl.
I'm Kenny Courteous when it comes to my
Kenny
load.
Courteous. By the way, I'm getting yelled at. Patrick Ewing was voted one of the top 50 NBA players of all time. Yeah, I know that, but we were talking top five earlier. Top fucking five, and someone put Ewing on their list, and that's just dumb.
Yeah.
Marino, one of the top five football players of all time?
I'd top 10.
Top 10?
Yeah. There might be, you know, Montana. Johnny Unitas.
A guy that might have won some Super Bowls. That hurts, doesn't it?
It doesn't really hurt. I don't know. You know,
Bradshaw.
You're a Dolphins fan. It hurts.
What are you going to do?
You're like my father-in-law. He's a massive Dolphins fan, too. And he's still talking about Marino, so you're right. He just wants a fucking new guy in there that could get the job done.
I think Marino secretly likes that Miami hasn't a quarterback since
him. Of course. Why wouldn't you?
he likes it.
You think Brett Favre wanted Green Bay to win a Super Bowl without him?
But he'll be the one to recruit Peyton down to Miami.
Because
they're buddies. Peyton
Marino?
Marino, yeah. I work with Marino on Inside the NFL in like 2005. I did a season on there on HBO. He's fucking unbelievable. Yeah. Greatest guy in the world.
You love him too. How cool is that?
Oh, and we went to dinner with him a couple times.
Can you get an autograph from my father-in-law? That's all he wants.
Did you get a picture?
I got like six.
Really?
Yeah. It's on my website, jimflorentine.com, of course. But I got at least six of them.
The only time I get a second picture with a celebrity is because I forgot. Like Henry Winkler, I got a picture with him, you know, the Fonz, because I thought I didn't have a picture with him. And then I looked on my website and went, oh, fuck you, idiot. You already have a picture.
No, you got it. I got like, I think Ozzy is in the lead with like nine pictures.
Nine pictures?
Yeah.
You get the Lemmy pic.
Lemmy, I got about six.
Yeah.
Oh, it's on my tour dates page. Check on that. Yeah.
We might have to break already because we have how many? 16 live reads today for Valentine's Day, Sam?
Yeah, you got 16 reads today.
16.
And
why don't we promote Florentine's one-man show? We'll take a quicker break this time, I promise. And I want to get into this Greg Kelly thing because we were all about this from day one. And once again, we're right. And the mainstream media was too scared to say half the shit we did at the time.
Jim Florentine, his one-man show is called I'm Your Savior. I'm going to see it for the first time this Friday. It's at the Producers Club. It's 44th Street, 358 44th Street. You can go to jimflorentine.com, brownpapertickets.com.
Tickets are there. Yeah, there's only a few left, so I'm doing it next weekend, too, 10 and 11, 17, 18.
I'm mad, man. We just had a guy, he just hung up. He says, wants to talk about how heartbreaking the Peyton Manning situation is for Colts fans.
It's got to be, man. Because you want him to keep. You don't want to see him in another uniform.
And he's been there forever, right?
And they're treating him like shit, man. That guy, that franchise, he saved that franchise. He got that new stadium built, and they're just gonna fucking throw him to the side, man. It's not right.
And he's gonna be looking like one of those athletes in someone else's uniform, and it never looks right.
Yeah, when Montana went to the Chiefs,
right?
And, you know, Marino's.
Namath, I think he went to the Rams.
He went to the Rams. Marino
just didn't look right. Him with that jersey on.
Marino had a lot of offers when Wanstead forced him out, when Wanstead took over the team after Jimmy Johnson, and he just couldn't do it, man. He said, you know, he's like, couldn't be in another uniform. He knew he could play another year or two, too.
And they pretty much built that stadium, you're right, for Peyton.
Without a doubt.
It's a gorgeous place. Holy
keep
fuck.
Him 1 year. Go, look, we'll keep you 1 year. Andrew Luck stays underneath you, and then you can. We'll figure it out after the year. See how you throw, how you play.
You think you could still play? It's a neck injury.
They say the next fine, it's the tricep muscle that's connected to the neck or something like that. That's not strong, so his arm's not strong right now. It's only at like 40%.
Oy.
So that's the problem. The neck is healed.
So
he can
how
take
the fuck
a hit.
Is he going to play next year?
Well, they're hoping the muscle to the tricep's going to heal, but right now he can only supposedly throw about 40%, which is like a Chad Pennington.
Yeah, no shit.
That was Brady in the Super Bowl. That's what I was saying. He was Chad Pennington. He fucking guy never threw a ball over 3 yards. The two he did, he got, you know, the safety and the interception.
Mm-hmm.
It was fucking awful.
Yeah.
Throw the ball downfield already. Goddamn gayness with this fucking football.
Did you want the Giants to win?
Yeah, I wanted the Giants, but just the whole shit, the fucking gay commercials and the gay halftime. It's like, come on already.
You sent
the
funny tweet, Joe, or it was a tweet about, look, notice all of the bad deadpan acting in these commercials, and it's like, that's what they do.
Every commercial is just a white guy just a deadpan. What? Well, I don't know.
The dumb white guy.
The dumb white, but I noticed the scruff. They give you a little scruff, because then you want to look like the everyman.
Right.
If you got a little scruff, then the guy at home go, hey, I walk around with scruff because I don't shave for a couple days. I could have that product too. Really? That's what you fucking think? Mm-hmm. How about, hey, you like this? Fucking buy it. All right, stop with the fucking three white guys and the Bud Light commercial and the light-skinned black guy.
Right.
You don't like that?
No.
All good-naturedly joking around?
Yeah, and then the hot girl walks in, and you've never seen a hot girl before. The look on their face like, Really, yeah, no, yeah, guys aren't on fucking YouPorn and fucking Pornhub 24 hours a day. They're really going to go, with a girl that has clothes on. Fuck you.
You don't like when they have all the, give your man card, and they're doing something goofy?
Yeah, give your man card. That's just another way. You're fucking gay. That's what it is. But that's the new thing. Your man card. That's okay.
Oh, I hate that one. Yeah, of course.
Because some guy's going to fucking rock wall a foot off the ground. Yeah, he's going to do that.
Mm-hmm.
While his friends look. Yeah, that's believable.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the guy's going to lift his shirt in fucking New Orleans to get beads. Yeah, he doesn't know that he shouldn't do that. That's real fucking believable. I see someone laugh at that. I go, get the fuck out of my house. Get out. That's not fucking funny. It never has been, never will.
Super Bowl is just a weird phenomenon. Because football is such a sport, and then your team gets in it, and then it's all this pomp and circumstance that's more than the actual game in the end.
Look, there's enough gayness on TV. There is, with all the fucking reality shows, with all the Voice and all that shit, America's Idol, America's Got Talent, all that crap. There's enough of that on TV, and then they have to put it in the Super Bowl for chicks.
Mm.
But chicks don't care. That's the problem. If you put Slipknot on at halftime for the Super Bowl show, people are still going to watch the Super Bowl. The ratings are not going to go down.
Right.
The chicks are coming to the Super Bowl party. It's an event now.
Yeah, of course.
It's an event.
You got them.
You go wherever. So, we're having one. Okay, and all the girls go.
Slipknot's crazy, obviously, but we said the other day, AC/DC.
They should do it every year.
Let's do AC/DC next year.
Yeah, I don't know why that. I wonder if AC/DC has said no.
Let's just do this.
How could they not have asked AC/DC?
Do it every year. AC/DC should do it every year.
What do you think of Madonna?
It was horrendous.
Lip syncing,
just all. Fucking outfits and terrible.
Yeah, let's say hi to this guy.
But even the girls didn't like it, though. That's the thing. Like, girls watched it for like a minute. They think all the females are going to watch it. They go, oh, if I had that money, I could look like that. Yeah, if I had plastic surgery, too. She's a grandmother. She's 52 years old. I wouldn't be wearing
that. You're right.
That.
They're all catty
That's
bitches.
That's all fucking catty bitches. And 2 minutes later, they go drink another fucking margarita room. And they walk away from the TV. I would look like that, too, if I had that money. Shut the fuck up. Yeah. You don't, because you're fucking lazy. At least she fucking worked her ass off and sucked the right dicks.
She doesn't look that good, by the way.
Oh, I think she looks good for 53.
You got to see the pictures when she's not on stage. It's horrendous. She's got these big, huge cheeks, and the Botox makes her face move strangely.
No, I like how she looks.
She's got too much face work done. She looks like a Muppet.
Yeah, well, they don't need any of that stuff. Just fucking put ZZ Top next season. That'd be perfect.
That'd be all right. You got to think guys. Like, football is generally a guy sport, and Madonna's the halftime show.
They want to keep. They want. If they're not the halftime show, so they already have the men, so they don't care. They want to just put a... But then again, they do use guy acts sometimes. Like Dan McCartney, they have Springsteen.
Well, those make sense.
Okay, yeah. Look, everybody goes to a Super Bowl party. You tell me next year, they go, Slipknot is the halftime fucking band for a Super... You think girls are going to go, hey, your friend's having a party. No, I'm going to stay home. I don't even know the Slipknot band. No, they're going to go to the party anyway.
Of course.
It doesn't matter. It's an event right now. Everybody leaves the house or has a party at their house. Doesn't fucking matter who's at halftime.
Well, they're over-marketing everything.
I don't want
and overthinking
shit.
Everything.
You know, we're football fans. Where's it? Where are these fucking people?
Oh, all right. Go ahead, buddy. This is the guy from Indiana.
Oh shit! I didn't realize I was on the air.
Yeah, go ahead.
No. I mean, this was the. I almost can't even remember what I was calling for, but
about Peyton Manning. You spoke up and fucked up Florentine's rant there. So go.
No, I'm sorry, Jim. I love you. Coming to Indiana. We
oh, my God.
Opie. All right, here's the thing.
Here's the thing right here. That's the thing.
So
Slipknot as the halftime show would be terrific.
You know, where is everybody at these? Where are all these women and everybody else that are trying to appeal for the Super Bowl when your team's 3-8, week 11, and you're fucking miserable and you're watching them, you know, 7-3 midway through the fourth quarter? I'm there every week.
Giants were 3-8.
No, I'm just saying, like, you know, any football
scare
fan.
Scare me for a second, yeah.
Any football fan, where are they?
Yeah. Well, good point.
You know, can we just have one day in one game where we don't have to see any of that crap? Elton John running around, fucking, you know, every celebrity in a Pepsi commercial. We're dancing and we're singing. It's fucking awful. Well, just put that shit on somewhere else.
That's why I like the AFC Championship game and the NFC Championship game way better than the Super Bowl when it really comes down to it. Because it's still a true just football experience, you know? There's not all that shit on the sidelines. Nothing. You don't even know where your team is. There's so much shit going on.
Once you do a Florentine, like, once you talk like that, you can't not do it. Me and Kenny were traveling, and we saw an Applebee's, and it's all we're doing is talking to each other, like, you want to go to Applebee's?
Yeah.
It's Applebee's.
Yeah, it's a neighborhood bar and grill.
Yeah.
Kenny even texted me when he goes, we just ate at Applebee's, or maybe you did. We just ate at Applebee's.
Yeah. No, you go to see Jim's stand-up, and there'll be, like, a married couple in the front row, and he'll go, like, what'd you have to take a nap to stay up so late? What'd you take her to Applebee's before the show?
Don't do that, because no one's going to come to my show.
Yeah, but don't do that. Don't do that.
I never wanted a microphone to be a shotgun so badly.
No, I don't do it anymore, because I used to try to incorporate Applebee's in my new act each time.
It is funny, though.
But he's hoping for the Applebee's sponsorship, so he's leaving them alone.
If you have a romantic date and you take him to your favorite French restaurant...
What, Roy Roger's?
That's one of my favorite Jim jokes ever. Roy Roger's.
That's one of like the first jokes I ever did.
But literally, you can't go buy a Roy Rogers without going Roy Roger's. It's fucking. It's been stuck in my head for 20 years since 1990. I've been thinking that.
Hey, this guy just reminded me of something because we're talking football. Chris in Kansas City. What about Breast Cancer Month in the NFL when they all wear pink? Obviously, it's for a great cause.
I don't mind that,
but
that doesn't bother me.
Why do they have to wear the pink, though?
That doesn't really bother me that much.
A lot of their mothers or whatever, it may affect all of them, too, so they may not mind doing it. I don't mind that as much, either.
It is for a good cause. Madonna that shit, you know, Black Eyed Peas halftime, that's nothing. There's no reason for that. That's just a commissioner that's completely out of touch, that has no clue what's going on.
All
that's
the
a piece of shit.
All the Peyton Manning fans are now checking in, and we won't go to the phones because we got to get to live reads, but they owe Manning $23 million, so it makes it tough to fucking
28.
It's 28.
On March 8th, he gets a $28 million pay, or they cut him.
So they have to release him before March 8th, and that's...
And you get 40%, they're going to dump him. Yeah. I can almost understand their point, though. If, like, if he might not be able to throw past 50%,
right,
that's a lot of money to give up.
Right, unless he heals, they're going to check, you know.
$28 million, so they got to let him go.
Yeah, unless they can work something out. Go, look, you know, like...
You're hurt.
Don't worry about the $28 million. Give me $5 million on May 1st if I'm 100%. They can work something out. But that owner, Ursray, wants him out.
But Peyton, he'd want his $28 million.
Yeah, you know, he took a lot lower. He took like a $100 million contract when he could have got like $180. He's done that a couple times in his career. He's not a whore like that, even though he does every awful commercial. His commercials are horrendous. Stink. There's not one funny thing about anyone ever. Maybe he's good on Saturday Night Live. I never saw that stuff. Everyone says he's really good on there.
Him and Eli, when they do their commercials, they're horrendous.
Oh, that. And
now you know why they're so good at football. There's nothing else going on in their brains.
Yeah, and then just Peyton alone. I remember my friend laughed at it. There was a commercial where he had a football wrapped up as a Christmas gift.
Oh, right.
And the guy goes, a football? He goes, no. And he started laughing. I just wanted to punch him in the face.
It really
Gino
is awful.
Visconti thinks every Peyton Manning commercial is
Gino
funny.
Gino and his dumb monkey.
He's like, no, that's funny. That was a good one. They're not.
Does he still travel with his monkey?
Oh, him and Justin Timberlake. Remember when they were playing ping pong?
Yeah, yeah.
Remember and Justin Timberlake scored a point? He's like, it's hot. My paddle's hot. It's hot.
Did you laugh at that?
Oh, yeah, I get it. Oh, because you're on a roll? Is that what it is? You're beating them, so the paddle got hot? Fucking homo.
But you know what? If Peyton's taking less money over the years, then maybe they should give him the $28 million.
I've heard rumors that Peyton is
Why
going
to give him.
Because he might not heal, and I've heard he's going to Atlanta. I mean, I didn't hear Miami. I heard he was going to Atlanta February 16th through 18th.
My God.
To the Punchline Comedy Club, where I will be.
Well, I hear that you're going to be making the big Peyton Manning announcement from the stage.
Yes. I don't want to say what it's
going to
be.
No, see, I heard he was going to Kansas City, because February 22nd to the 25th at Stanford and Sons.
That's a comedy club.
Because he's coming to see my show. Because he's going to do rehab in Kansas City. That's what I heard.
What's the, Florentine, what's the one-man show? We got to take a break.
It's this weekend, February 10, 11, and next weekend, 17, 18, at the Producers Club, 44th and 9th in New York City. Go to jimflorentine.com on the tour dates. You can get tickets there.
All right, more with Jim Florentine.
SiriusXM, the Opie and Anthony Show.
Imagine this at the Super Bowl. Turn this up. Halftime show. Let's do this. Is the NFL listening? I think Brewer turned me on to the live version of this online. I think it's from their DVD with the whole fucking crowd. It's like 100,000 people.
Oh, it's
all
live. Donington. Live at River Plate.
Everyone is just bouncing at the same time.
That's at Live at River Plate. It's a new one from, they played in Argentina for the first time in 14 years.
Right.
80,000 people at 80,000,
okay. All moving as one.
One of the greatest DVDs ever you'll ever see.
Yeah, I think Thunderstruck is the song in concert that everyone gets behind.
Yeah.
And the whole crowd moves as one. I've never seen that before in my life. Some bands come close with some of their hits, but Thunderstruck just gets the job done. Fuck! Jim Florentine in studio. One-man show this weekend, right?
Yeah, New York City.
New York City. I got to go.
JimFlorentine.com. Yeah, I'll save you a seat.
Yeah, I would love to go.
Friday and Saturday night. It's 10 o'clock, and that's also next weekend, too.
All right.
And Jim will be with me tonight. My Boneyard show is moving to 9 p.m. Starting tonight, they just told me. So from now on, no more 10 o'clock. It's now 9 p.m. East Coast time. They're playing the Zach Wilde roast at 10 o'clock after. And Jim will be my guest tonight, of course. Yeah. And then the roast is right after that.
I can't wait to hear all the audio of the roast. That's great.
When do I become a guest?
Whenever you want. You can come on.
Give me a band. I'll tell you what song I would play.
Leonard Skinner.
You play Leonard Skinner?
Yeah. It's more classic rock. I can play Ozzy. Again, I can play pretty much what I want.
Leonard Skinner, I would go with Give Me Back My Bullets.
Okay.
Godsmack.
Oh, Godsmack. You know what? I'm starting to like the slower stuff, like Voodoo.
I love that song.
Right.
Voodoo, I like. Give me another one. Come on.
Owls and Chains.
Owls and Chains, I would do Nutshell.
Oof.
See, you don't have to play the hits to get the job done. Oof. Too many
Jar
years.
Jar of Flies, greatest acoustic album of all time.
Nutshell is an amazing song that no one played on regular radio. Nobody played that fucking song for whatever reason. One more band. Come on. I like this.
Thin Lizzy.
See, I don't know much about Thin Lizzy.
All right.
I would go Jailbreak, I guess, because I just don't know much about them.
Buck Cherry.
Buck Cherry, I don't know much about these days.
All right.
The one about the bitch.
Crazy Bitch?
Crazy Bitch. I like Buck Cherry. They just came out at the wrong fucking time. Imagine that band if they came out 20 years ago?
Absolutely. Disturbed.
Disturbed, I would go with Land of Confusion, the cover.
That was a good cover, but
you didn't
I
like it?
It was good. It was good.
That whole first album was amazing.
First album is a masterpiece.
Yeah. I think The Game is my favorite song off that album. That is
really
fucking heavy, man.
Down with the Sickness, too.
Very good.
I would probably go with Down with the Sickness, maybe.
I prefer The Game, though.
That song still is just amazing. It's
Enemy's a good song, too.
Enemy is great.
This is The Game. This is the first song I ever walked onto when I started using walk-on music in 2001 or 2 in the TLA.
It's been in a couple of those race car video games, too.
Oh, this is so fucking...
I love when it kicks in.
Oh, it's fucking great.
It almost sounds like old school Sticks in the beginning here.
Yeah.
That's how it kicks in.
Yes, lawman.
Yeah. We've talked to this guy once. Just once. He was intense. All right, we gotta do radio. We can play music all day. That's easy. Anyone can do that shit. Greg Kelly from Good Day New York here in New York City is going to be back on the air Friday. He's the guy that was accused of rape by a woman. And as soon as this story came out, and it's a tough spot to take, but we're like, this is all bullshit. And then the women get mad, like, come on, you got to take this rape shit seriously. But looks like he met this woman. They had a few drinks, and then she invited him to her office, and they had a little sex. And then we thought that maybe the boyfriend found out, and then all of a sudden she has to come up with a story. And she says that this Greg Kelly guy, who's a pretty big TV guy here in New York, raped her.
And his father. Oh, Jesus, sorry. And his father is the fucking police commissioner, Ray Kelly.
Yeah, Ray Kelly. And we jumped on this right away, said, no fucking way. This just smells fishy. Smells suspicious.
It smells like she got busted.
Yep. And then she claimed that he got her pregnant and all sorts of shit. Turns out that they are not going to go, he's cleared. He's cleared of bombshell rape charges.
Good.
So he'll be back on TV tomorrow.
There's always a saying when indictments, you can indict a ham sandwich. It's that easy
right. To
get an indictment, and then, you know, you've got to figure it out later. But obviously, she's walking down the street, and she sees him because she recognizes him on TV. She's like, you're so hot. You're cute.
Right.
Even in person, and they exchange numbers on the street.
Right.
Let's go meet for drinks. They go meet for drinks, and obviously, she can't take him back to her place because she has a boyfriend. She lives with a boyfriend, so she takes to her office building a couple blocks away. They fuck in there. And then the next day and the next week, let's get together again, sexing back and forth, sexual messages. And then 3 months later, out of the blue, I guess the boyfriend found out, hey,
he
raped me.
Yeah.
Real, why didn't you tell? I don't know. So how did he drag you up there? I want to know what her story was to the boyfriend.
Right.
That the boyfriend made her go, you know, say he raped her. Like, how do you get up into your office building then? What were you going to do? Just show him your fucking desk?
Right.
Is that what you're going to do?
After a few drinks.
No, we got this new copier. You got to take a look at it. We just had a bunch of drinks. Fuck you, you whore.
Good for you. You're right, too, because what is the excuse to get into the building?
Mm. Yeah.
It wasn't like they fucked in an alley. If they fucked in that building, how do you say you got... What was the reason? Even if... Let's say it's true. Let's say he raped you.
There was
why
no
were you going
go
up to that
office.
Fucking office? For what?
Yeah.
For
no
what?
Reason to go back there unless you want to fool around a little
bit.
Yeah,
do you need a pen to exchange numbers again?
Right.
Is that what you need it for?
So she got caught and then...
She probably said, he asked you where I worked, so he's showing you.
Yeah, I know, because he really wants to see your office.
So then she needed a story...
Yeah, because it looks like different than any other fucking office.
She needed a story for the boyfriend, and she goes, well, he raped me, and I didn't know how to tell you.
I wonder how the boyfriend found out.
And then this Greg Kelly is all over the fucking news as a potential rapist. Holy fuck. And we said, no way is this story true. We said it. We can pull the tape. That just didn't make sense.
She's sexy, though. God damn it. I'd still fuck her.
Now they're throwing her picture all over the papers.
Yeah.
Good.
And what's her name, who we don't really like in the
Henry
paper?
Pizer.
She's basically saying that they should prosecute this broad.
She said, let's put the girl who cried wolf on trial instead. Absolutely.
Yeah, because it fucks up other women that were raped.
Yeah.
They already said, because her story was consistent, she didn't change it the two times she went in there. They're not going to... You know, file charges against her.
Right.
So what? It was still a lie. Both times it was a lie when you brought it
but
in.
But I wonder if Greg Kelly may not want to file because then all the texts come out, and there's probably things he said that he's embarrassed about. So that may be coming from him and Ray Kelly going, look, let's just let this go away so you're not more embarrassed.
Yeah, he probably just wants it to go away at this point.
Yeah,
probably, because then a text's going to come out like, sorry, I had a small dick. I hope, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
You were drunk, you know.
I hope it was adequate.
Yeah, I hope it was adequate. I, you know.
You, or do you have any buddies that could fuck me in the ass while we hug? Yeah. You know, something really humiliating.
Right. Yeah. Sorry, my balls smell like onions that night. I'll wash them this time. Yeah,
or he badmouthed this fucking somebody on the air with him. Putting it out. She likes to tickle my nipples while I shit.
Yeah, he's probably like, all right, can we just all move on now?
Yeah, buddy? He doesn't want his private text messages out because all that shit will come out.
He's not a married guy, I guess, huh?
No.
Because they didn't talk about him being married. Yeah, so I'm very appreciative of all the positive support I've received, Kelly said as he walked out of Fox 5's offices after the sit-down. So he had a sit-down. They said, yeah, you're good. We're going to put you back on the air Friday. So, God, they're going to get big ratings tomorrow, huh?
And let's see if what bothers me about... How about he be honest on TV and just say how aggravating this is or enraging. But don't just go, look, we know some things have happened, but they're under... See, we sanitize everything. Nobody just talks honestly. Like, go on. You don't have to give all the dirty details, but how about you go on tomorrow and you say, this is enraging.
Right.
I was falsely accused of a heinous crime.
Right.
And, you know.
He's not.
He won't. He'll be like, you know, we're going to put some incidents, and he'll gloss over it in the sanitized way we do everything.
He'll
country.
Have a 20-second statement type of thing.
Yes.
Up front, and then they'll move on. And then, what's her name, Rosanna Scotto, whatever her name is, will be like, oh, I'm so happy to have you back.
Yes, and they'll do this. You know, we believed in you all the way, Greg. And coming up, and they'll do the little paper state. Coming up.
Yeah.
And they'll move on.
All right, well.
It would be funny if he just did a 45-minute workout, got uncomfortable. He just kept going, that fucking cunt. And he was showing her picture. I fucked her mouth. And he self-destructs on Fox. And her pussy stung. He just has a meltdown.
Just loses it.
Yeah.
That'd be great if Rosanna goes, all right, we're going to go to break now. Ray, I'm going to go show you my office real quick.
Yeah.
And just go to commercial just to fuck with that girl. We used to always get, like, me and Jameson were famous for this whenever, you know, we hook up with a girl on the road, we'd always get a confirmation text that she had a good time and save it.
Yeah, Jimmy's talked about this stuff a
always.
Bit.
Always. You know, did you have a good time last night? Yeah. Well, huh? You know, because I wanted to get it in writing. Right. I had an amazing time. Can't wait for you to come back in town. Let's stay in touch.
Right.
Beautiful.
So you guys got files saved.
Oh, you know, every time Jameson would be like, got the confirmation text, 9 a.m., he would send me a text. It's like,
here's what you got to do.
You got to word it, right? You got to keep fishing. Because I go, yes. Yeah. I go, did you have a great time? Yes. What does that mean? What do you mean that? What does that mean? Mm-hmm. Tell me exactly.
What did Jimmy say? You walked by the...
That was Voss who does it at the hotel lobby.
Oh.
That's the best thing ever.
But I have a
make sure someone else sees you with the girl or whatever as she's leaving.
Voss would bang a girl. Of course, he can't have someone sleep next to him because he's, you know, he's out of his mind.
He has Asperger's, yeah.
Yeah, so he'd walk the girl down. Instead of just throwing her out of the room, going, all right, I'll see you, you know, whatever. He'd walk the girl down to the front desk, out to her car, but stop at the front desk, go, hey, can I get a wake-up call for 5:30 a.m.? And the dork behind the
She's got a witness.
But then he would also crack jokes. He'll go like, you know, do you think I look like Ricky Martin or whatever? And the guy, ha, ha, ha. The girl's laughing, ha, they're all laughing. Okay, all right. And then he walks her outside. So that guy goes, yeah, she was cracking up at the front desk at 5:30 in the morning. He walked her outside.
Wow.
You have to.
Yeah.
You know, because look, I mean, you know, Paris Hilton, Kim Kardashian, all these chicks, all the fucking, you know, with Jesse James, all those girls get fucking, you know, these girls these days go, oh, you know what, I might be able to get on a reality show if I fuck somebody, claim rape, do whatever,
put out
a porno tape.
You're on Celebrity Rehab or something.
So there's a lot of incentive for them to do that shit.
Just a hoax, right? Do you guys seriously like Godsmack?
Yeah. I do.
Fuck yeah.
I don't know why everybody has a problem with Godsmack. We had Sully on our show and people
Sully's
like,
awesome.
That's not metal. I mean, Godsmack's metal.
Yeah, they are. Of course they are.
I'm not even putting bands in genres. I just like the band. Of course I like Godsmack.
As soon as a band gets start played on the radio, that's it. Everybody, it's got to hate them for some reason.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They get to the next level. You know, they want them to be a club band the rest of their life. Mm-hmm. You know, I saw them when they were playing in front of 100 people. Yeah, well, now they're fucking bigger. Remember when you were a fucking plumber and now you're, you know, you got your own business and you don't have to fucking deal with turds every day?
Or now you're still a plumber and that's why you don't understand advancement? Remember when you were a plumber and now that's what you do? So you think everyone should do the same thing forever, dumbbell?
I could kind of see it both ways, because when you do discover a band that no one else really knows about, you kind of get bummed when everyone else starts, you know...
But
you got to understand that there's not a band alive that doesn't want to be in arenas.
Somebody starts.
Name one band that would never want to be in an arena for real.
Every band does.
Exactly. So in the end, that is their goal, to be heard by more people.
Any other job, you're allowed to move up. You start at the bottom and you move up and everybody's happy for you, except for a musician, a comedian, or sports guy or whatever. Yeah, I remember him when he played high school football here. Mm-hmm. And now he's a big shot. He's in the pros. No, he's not a fucking big shot. He just fucking worked his ass off.
And moved on. So there you go. Greg Kelly's off the hook.
Good for him.
I love that they got her name out there. They got a picture in the paper. That's beautiful.
Because I don't think the guy's face or name should be shown until he's convicted. If they're going to protect the victim, which I'm fine with, you got to protect the guy accused until he's convicted, because then he's forever branded a rapist.
Mm-hmm.
It's fucking horrible. You think that a woman is the only one with a sexual stigma attached on a rape?
And she knew it was bullshit, and then she has to find out Greg Kelly is Ray Kelly's son. She must have been shitting a brick.
She might have known that anyway and just panicked.
I think we said it off air, Jimmy, but... obviously, her pictures was going to be all over the papers today. You don't think Ray Kelly has connections to the media?
Well, of course he does.
Yeah, it's probably not going to be in the New York Times, but it's in the Post.
Well, it's right there for everyone.
But this is the problem. This guy, you know, Ray Kelly's got kids. You know, say he has kids in 10 years, and then fucking 25 years from now, these kids can Google that and see that he was fucking accused of rape.
Yeah.
Their dad, you know, because of this whore.
Yeah. It's not fair. It happens. His assholes out.
He had all those confirmation texts. It shouldn't even got to that point.
Right.
It shouldn't even got to the point where it made the papers.
Right.
With all that shit. If some girl's going, I want to fuck you again. You were amazing. They didn't get raped right there.
I think she said she doesn't even remember having sex with him.
Yeah. Like, you know, of course.
When they really started questioning her, she's like, they were asking details. And she's like, didn't even really have much details about
it. But then it came out they weren't even that drunk. People that saw him in the bar, they weren't even that hammered. Yeah.
Speaking of music, we got the latest song from up-and-coming band.
Wow.
Yeah. Should I just play it, or?
Are we breaking it?
Play it, I'll see if I know who they are.
Okay.
Yeah, SFPs, I might do like a thing called igloo melting. We rock so hard, we melt igloos. So hard, we're like a bunch of, like, big rocks.
Igloo melting, igloo melting. Igloo melting, 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 igloo melting.
We rock so heavy, only the devil can lift it.
I don't like that song.
You don't like Sick Fucking Puppies?
I love the Sick Fucking Puppies.
But you don't like that one?
No.
Maybe that's like a B-side.
Yeah.
Bands need B-sides.
I don't like the fact that other people put in their own vocals. Trying to jump on an SFP fucking bandwagon.
You know that...
What happened?
You weren't here yesterday.
I was here. I just chose not to talk yesterday.
Oh.
Me and Chez were just hanging out.
Chip Chipperson changed his name.
To what?
Peppy Sinclair.
Why? Why?
It's more show busy, he thinks.
Yeah.
He came to the realization that acting like it was the 1940s was charming.
Gentlemanly, yeah.
Really?
Yes, it is.
It's just exhausting.
I know it is.
Your brain is exhausting.
It really is horrible. It's just fun, though. It really is. It keeps it fun. It's so dumb.
Because I know you mean it. That's what's so exhausting about it.
Do you understand? I was in my mirror
saying
to myself, I'm Peppy Sinclair.
But Peppy would be in the mirror doing that.
He would. With lifting
practicing.
Gentlemanly.
Yeah.
Good afternoon.
Who else was in the apartment?
At that point, it was just me and Chip.
Do you have multiple personality disorder?
No. I don't even have one good one.
You have to have one good one before you can even think about it.
Yeah.
Very, very good.
He's just, you know, it's just a version of a bad comic. that has the worst jokes that we've been around. And then the elbowing thing is that is a Levy thing, yeah, right?
That's exactly where it's from. Hey. But I do it like Levy. Exactly where it comes from.
What's going on with Levy? He wrote me an email. I don't know what's going on with this guy. And his grammar's horrible, so I don't even know what he wrote me. I really don't know what he wrote me.
It really is like getting a letter from Alphabet Soup.
Right. I don't know what he wrote me.
I'm telling you.
He's always missing
something
words.
About he's still not allowed in the building, but he might be allowed to do stuff for our show. But the reason he's not allowed in the building is because he was going to do our show, and Howard got mad and had nothing to do with him. I don't know. Does anyone know what's going on?
You guys are closer to him than me. I haven't talked to him, but I thought...
I love the guy.
Reading his emails and his tweets, I thought the ban was lifted. That's what I got from it.
I think the ban, as far as doing any radio for SiriusXM, is lifted. But I think
so
he's still not allowed.
He can call into the shows.
I don't know, because then like words were misspelled. And I wish I had it in front of me. I don't have it. Or do I? No, it's on my fucking phone at home. We're not allowed to have corporate email on our private phones, so we all have to carry around two fucking phones. Yeah, exactly. Give me that look. Isn't that dumb? Because then if they put the corporate email on your phone, then they own your phone.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
But you can't just get the corporate email to your phone?
Owning my fucking phone. No.
You have to open like a mobile web browser.
Am I lying, Sam?
No, not at all.
No, thank you.
Can't you?
No, you can't have corporate mail on a mail account on any iPhone or Android or whatever. You have to have a company BlackBerry. And then if you have your own personal BlackBerry, and it actually happened to Opie, and they put the corporate email on your personal BlackBerry, then they claim ownership of
it. Did you actually give them the BlackBerry?
Sam, this is reason 321 why I hate this place.
Okay. You didn't.
They took my private phone.
Why would you give it to them? I would have said no. You're not getting it. With that face.
I'm trying to remember how it went down, but somehow the tech department had my phone around the time.
It was like,
they said, we can't give it back to you. I'm like, it's my phone. I bought it. No, you handed over ownership when we put some software on there.
He was getting the corporate thing off of his old phone onto his new phone.
Oh, that's
so
what
he could take the old phone and give it to his brother-in-law or whatever.
No, I wanted to give it to my brother who makes no money. And I don't want to just continuing to dish out and fucking write checks. So I'm thinking, wow, I could give my brother my old phone, which is still a really good phone.
But they said wouldn't give it back.
They wouldn't give it back. So my phone that I bought, someone else around here probably has now.
I've never checked my corporate email.
Well, that's
probably things how I get a raise all in there. And, hey, Jim, Lady Gaga meeting opportunity. There's all these things from Mel. Like, hey, look, we'd love to give you a raise. Get back to me. And I just ignored.
And logically, after a while, I'm like, no, I'm not carrying two phones around. So I'm missing emails left and right. Like, I'll check my phone maybe once every 2 days. So corporate email, I'll check once. But yeah, a couple times a week. It's dumb.
I never check my SiriusXM account. So anybody that's ever sent me an email, do it to the real Jim Norton at Gmail. Because if there's one at SiriusXM for me, I wouldn't know it.
Yeah, but but Levy wrote me, and I don't even know what it's about. I have no idea.
Well, he wants to either do pre-recorded bits or call in.
But he's allowed to do that, but he's not allowed to come in.
Well, we can play, I think.
And he's not allowed to come in because Howard got pissed that he was doing our show. I think that's what I got from his email. But a lot of people thought he was banned for the building because he threatened people, and that wasn't the case because they have no record of that. I think that's what he's trying to tell me.
I thought they got mad because he said something on a podcast.
I don't know.
I don't even.
I didn't see that. So.
Yeah, I don't know exactly what's going on, but he's a good dude.
He's a very good dude.
I love Bubbly.
He's great.
I'm telling you.
Where are we, man? Roland Martin. Good old Roland Martin. He works for CNN, and I've said over the years, but you have to know our Roland, that he's the black Roland. He looks very much like our Roland. CNN suspends Roland Martin over offensive Super Bowl tweets. So Roland Martin, he's at home like all of us, and he's tweeting the Super Bowl. That's the thing to do these days. When these big events happen, you want to get on and hopefully tweet something that people enjoy, right?
Yep.
Roland Martin's tweets were regrettable and offensive, CNN said in a statement. Language that demeans is inconsistent with the values and culture of our organization and is not tolerated. We have been giving careful consideration to this matter, and Roland will not be appearing on our air for the time being. They're going to probably fire him. They're probably looking at his contract right now.
What PC fucking garbage.
It is garbage.
And you know what? People wonder, why does this happen? The only thing you can do to fight back against this, because he wasn't saying hit gay people or I hate gay. He was just saying, hey, if your friend, you know, has a pain. He was just being a guy, breaking balls, and GLAAD are thought and language police.
Right.
And the only thing you could do is call CNN
right.
and tell them that you will not watch if they're gonna behave this way. But no one will do that. No one gives a fuck.
You know.
It wasn't a gay commercial. It wasn't for a gay product.
Which was it? Was the Beckman commercial?
It was a Beckham commercial in his underwear.
Right.
You know,
let's see what he
advertising
wrote.
His underwear. It wasn't, you know, this is GLAAD and here's yeah. our model and
oh, Beckham, right.
It wasn't a gay commercial. It was for his underwear. Well, so it had nothing that Beckham's not gay. He's got a family, he's got a wife.
It was just seen as homophobic.
Let's see this. So this was the tweet that Martin wrote. If a dude at your Super Bowl party is hyped about David Beckham's H&M underwear ad, smack the ish out of him. And then he hashtagged the Super Bowl so a lot of people could read it. What's smack the ish mean?
Means shit.
Shit. Ish is shit or backwards. Like you know how in okay. hip-hop radio they reverse the curses?
No, I wouldn't know that.
Yeah.
Why would I know that?
No, you didn't. But that's where it comes from.
He's just making a joke. He's not saying gay should be beaten. And what GLAAD, and this is like GLAAD does such important shit.
No.
And then they fucking do this stuff. He's not advocating gay bashing.
Well, first of all,
or violence against gay. That's not what that's about.
The tweet is vague. He could absolutely be doing a gay thing there, but he could also be making a soccer joke. Because we all like to beat up on soccer fans.
That's what actually he was saying when he retorted. He said,
"But GLAAD is assuming a lot that it is absolutely yeah. a gay tweet or whatever.
I think it was
anti-gay
a
tweet.
But no, I don't think it was anti-gay. I think it was if you have someone who's excited to see David Beckham in his underwear, like if one of your buddies at the party is happy to see him in his underwear, smack the shit out of him.
Right.
It's not about. It's not a real thought. It's not. Hey, I really think there are people at your party that are watching David Beckham, and they're going to make that known, and you should strike them.
That's almost like a man-up commercial. You know, when he comes on, a guy's like, I'm going to go get the underwear. And you know what I mean? That's that commercial.
Right.
And then all his friends look at him like, are you kidding me? You lost your man card because you want to go get that underwear.
Abso-fucking.
That could be a commercial.
It's absolutely correct.
Yeah. Well, then he tweeted another one here. I guess the player was wearing pink from head to toe. So his tweet was, who the hell was that New England Patriot they just showed in a head-to-toe pink suit? Oh, he needs a visit from Team Whip Dad Ass. You might not like the case, but yeah. Let's be honest with each other.
He should be suspended for that corny tweet.
He's just corny.
But no, I mean, but that's...
He's just being a guy on Football Sunday. It's like, what happens with these groups, they can't see the difference between somebody really advocating violence against somebody and what is acceptable in humor. And they say, well, it fosters a climate of hate speech. But that's a lie. They say that because it's the only way they can somehow rope what you're doing
right.
into their arena, which can get you into trouble.
Sure.
It's bullshit.
It should be allowed. All this stuff should be allowed.
If he said, hey, David Beckham, if you're looking at him, you're a faggot, you should be That's coming from a different place, and
right,
the intention of that's different. That's not to make you laugh or to be silly or stupid.
Right.
That's to like go. I really think this guy should be beaten up because he's gay. There's a big difference.
Right. There certainly is.
We all. So basically, if language is that important, if he said, "Oh man, I want the Patriots to kill the Giants," do you literally think he wants them to take a knife and stab the Giants?
Right.
Of course you don't. You understand what he's saying by context.
Yeah, and what if the Patriots is an all gay team and they say, "I want the Giants to kill the Patriots"? Would that be? You know, you want to kill gay people because they're all gay.
An all-gay football team, huh?
Yeah. Just saying.
I'm just thinking about it, if that's possible.
It is.
Is it?
Sure it is. Bunch of cocksuckers playing football, getting each other off. Nothing wrong with that.
Look, let's just say we're at a Super Bowl party.
They would never hike the ball.
No, they wouldn't.
Let's say we're at a Super Bowl party and Opie walks in and goes, I got that new David Beckham underwear. Are we just going to start beating the crap out of him?
And why would I say that?
All right, but just
why do I have to be the example always? Because
you have the best body.
Because you would.
You're the guy that belongs in those underwear.
Why do I have to be the guy that walks into your Super Bowl party and goes, hey, guys, I got the new David Beckham H&M underwear on?
Who's more likely to have it on their beautiful body than you, though?
But can't you use someone else's?
example?
Underwear. Dude, you got a fucking V. You got a bodybuilder physique. You should be one of those.
It
underwear.
Doesn't work.
How does it go down, though?
It doesn't work with Jim because he'd wear it and he'd wear it proud.
But how does it go down? I enter your Super Bowl party. What's going
in,
on? You guys are hanging
know.
Out.
Just
you're
fucking around.
Eating some chips. The game's not on yet.
I'm having a bunch of beers and everyone's just getting silly. So, yeah. You know, Kenny fucking moons somebody.
Okay.
Yeah.
Somebody, I whip out my balls. I'm like, look at my sack. And then you go, yeah, look at my gay underwear, whatever it is. Like, where'd you get that? Oh, to David Beckham. You know, right. My H&M commercial. Yeah, I just went and got his underwear. My chick likes it.
So if I'm invited to your house, I got to show my underwear.
No, you don't have to. But we're not just going to gang up on you and just start beating the shit out of you.
Well, let's say the David Beckham commercial was on.
Yeah.
And Ope had those underwear on, and he went, oh, look at that. I got those. He's excited to see David Beckham in his underwear.
Yeah. Or we're all talking at a commercial, and then it comes on. Ope's like, shh.
I got those.
Yeah.
We're not going to beat him up.
I got
special underwear on right now. Would you like to
hole
see?
In the back.
You see?
Yeah.
Yeah. And my wife has described them as gay underwear that she bought, by the way.
Why?
She bought.
Is there a little plug in the back?
I got a pretty good piece.
I know you do.
And so these particular underwear have like a kind of like extra room in front.
Really?
Let's see
it's
it.
Like a what pouch. Do you fill it with?
I said I'm all right. Let me see. I don't know if
he fills it with this. It's like a shoe when you have newspaper crammed in the front.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like the material pops out in front a little bit so you can get everything in there. Without
it's
it
almost
being
like a V cut.
Body. I don't know. It's a little extra material there.
Nice.
Yeah. Fuck, man. Oh, how do we do the show after that?
Distracted and erect.
Yeah. Well, I'm wearing my chick's underwear and there's nothing in the front.
Really?
Not bulge. Nothing.
So you want to know? You want to hear the apology from Martin here? Roland Martin.
Yeah.
Martin first tried to defend his tweets as lighthearted ribbing of Beckham's sport. I made several cracks about soccer as I do all the time, Martin wrote on Twitter. I was not referring to sexuality directly or indirectly regarding the David Beckham ad. I'm not sure if that's true.
I think that's bullshit.
I'm not sure if that's true.
I think he's playing a semantics game there, yeah. And everybody knows what he was. But he wasn't gay bashing, but he was going, hey, if your friend thinks this is hot, smack him.
He was doing what guys do around other guys.
Yeah, fucking jerking off. I mean, you know.
You make fun of a guy that has underwear on TV.
Of course.
You would go there. That's what guys do, but we're not allowed to be guys anymore. Especially if you're in the spotlight. They'll kill you for it.
Yep.
I'm sorry folks took it otherwise. It was meant to be a deliberately over-the-top and sarcastic crack about soccer. I do not advocate violence of any kind against anyone, gay or not. As anyone who follows me on Twitter knows, anytime soccer comes up during football season, it's another chance for me to take a playful shot at soccer, nothing more. Yeah, but then he's got that tweet about the Pink guy, so.
Well, he also attacks the singer Pink. So if somebody was where I'm just stretching like he is.
Yeah, I know.
We know what you were saying. It's okay.
But you should be able to keep your job.
Do you think
you should be able to say some shit?
Does he lose it?
Yes. He'll be fired.
He's done.
Now, does it help that he's black, that maybe Glad will be afraid Jesse Jackson or Sharpton might?
No. They can't. No.
No?
Because they can't defend him on this. Because race has nothing to do with the tweet. They can't come to him.
Like Tracy Morgan, they didn't defend Tracy
Morgan. They didn't speak
up
for Tracy, because with gay shit, they don't want to fuck with gay organizations at all, because gay organizations side with them, usually on racial stuff. They don't even fuck with gay groups.
Well, here's the problem, too. Like, you know, when you're in the media, you used to be able to say pretty much whatever you wanted, and then all of a sudden you weren't allowed to say anything. So it's almost a relief that you have a Twitter account and you're able to say some shit that you're not allowed to say in your radio show, your TV show, and now the rules have changed and you're not allowed to tweet shit either.
But doesn't it show you how phony the media, and again, I'm generalizing.
Of course, I know what you're going to say before you say it.
These are the guys that scold everybody and do the paper shuffle, and then when you see in their own personal lives, they're all doing the same shit.
Everyone
is. No one is just a fucking honest, straight shooter.
It's all bullshit.
Okay, so what's the difference between the word man up and that's gay? What's the difference between that? That they use it in commercials, in the Bud Light commercials. Man up. You know, do something manly. Don't act like
mean?
A girl slash gay guy.
You're
so
gay, right?
What's the difference in that word?
The difference in their minds would be that the onus of the joke in man up is put on the man, and when you say you're acting gay, the punchline is the word gay and being gay. That would be their answer to that.
And know what Man Up used to be? Don't be a faggot.
Yeah, exactly. Of course.
And Jim Brewer explained it perfectly on our show. When we were growing up, when we were calling each other.
Brewer's gay.
Because Brewer's gay. When we were growing up, we threw around the word faggot among ourselves, not thinking gay. It was just a word.
Yeah.
I don't know how we learned it, but I didn't learn it thinking homosexuality or gay. But if your friend did something a little, you know, whatever, that wasn't manly, you'd go, say, stop being a faggot. But that word is like, you can't say that anymore. So now they replaced it with man up. It's the same shit.
And you know what?
It's the same shit.
It's the same word.
It's basically
it means it's the same meaning.
It's the answer to your question.
But you're allowed to use that.
You're allowed to say man up. But you're really saying what they really want to say in those commercials are stop being a faggot.
Yeah, like if you know, Jim goes, I like Madonna at halftime. I go, man up.
Yeah, but you would say.
But meanwhile, I'm just saying that you're gay. Or
here's how that conversation would go.
Yeah, I'm still saying,
I like Madonna. I think I'm a faggot. And Jim would go, yes, you are.
But don't be confused. We're not saying like Jimmy's gay for either calling him a faggot or saying man up.
You're calling me gay because I've been with transsexuals.
Exactly. That's the reason.
Fair point.
No, I'm serious.
Right.
Because that's what we did growing up. We didn't know any different.
Yeah.
But I knew what it was growing up. Like as a kid, I really did. I knew that faggot was a connection to guys blowing. Like. And I knew that that's what it... I took it like that, but
I guess we knew the definition, but we didn't...
Connect it to that, right?
Yeah, we weren't using it that way. Right. You're right. I mean, but...
You weren't connecting it to like, hey, come on, you faggot, throw the ball. You weren't going, hey, I think that you are attracted to other men. You weren't saying that.
Right.
It became more than a sexual orientation thing. It just became a jerk-off who wasn't doing something right.
But it's, you know, we're just changing the words. It's still the same shit.
Exactly.
Man up is equals faggot. You know, when we were using that. So why is man up okay on TV then? I think it should be okay, obviously, but...
And they never...
You know, you haven't fixed the problem.
No, you haven't.
You just made everyone try to come up with another way to say...
Whatever it is, in 10 years from now, whatever the word is, we're still going to use it.
Because man up will get a complaint from one LBGDTIRLL, whatever that group is, will complain about. It implies that not being masculine is not being as good. And when you're not saying as good, you're slamming the gate.
Right.
They'll tie it into their own shit like they always do.
So then man up will go away and we'll come up with, I don't know, rhinoceros or something.
Yeah.
We'll come up with some ridiculous word.
Hey.
Because you're not going to change how people think.
No.
You're just not.
Hey, guy neutral. Guy neutral. It's
just going to frustrate the hell out of everyone when you realize you can't express yourself anymore. You know? You're not going to change people's opinion on shit.
People deserve it.
Drastically, anyway.
They deserve it because they're not fighting back. No one is sticking up for it. So they all deserve what they're fucking getting because they're not.
Right.
None of these guys are standing up. You know why I haven't gotten in trouble for... And I'm not saying I can't. I don't get in trouble for what I say on Twitter. A, because I'm not relevant enough. But B, because if you're unapologetic about it, it's going to be harder for them to come after you.
Right.
If you make jokes about something and they criticize you and you go, fuck you, this is what I do, it's harder for them to persecute you.
Well, that's what happened with Corolla. Corolla made fun of like transgender people or something like that. And they go, we're going to take his podcast away. Like how? He fucking finances it himself.
I know.
He's got like .com advertisers. What are you going to do? You can't do anything to him.
You just be able to make jokes. And rough jokes, too.
Yeah.
Edgy jokes, dark jokes. You're not allowed to do that shit anymore.
Not at all. Unless it somehow pushes forth the point of view or ideology that they're comfortable with.
You know, it was weird when the whole Tracy Morgan thing went down. Tina Fey came out because he made some gay jokes. She says, we have gay writers. He had better apologize. But she never said anything about his act, his stand-up act, which is like the most sexist... disgusting, filthy act ever that he's been doing for years.
Right.
And everybody knows people run out of his shows in droves because he's so disgusting.
Oh, yeah.
I got no problem with it, obviously, but he's so sexist on stage, but no problem with that. And then 2 weeks later, he makes fun of the retards. He says the mentally handicapped, they're strong like chimps, them retards.
Right.
Doesn't say anything about that, so it was only the gay thing. So the PC police only picked that one out. Nothing about sexism, nothing about retards.
Because they're a strong organization. The other organizations aren't that strong yet, but they're getting there. They're getting there.
Well, you don't hear from the women's groups anymore. I think hip-hop did them in. You
know, smack them down.
Yeah, because everybody's so sexist in there, you can't go after anything anymore.
You don't even know where to begin.
Where are you going to go? Where are you going to start? Snoop's doing fucking commercials with Lee Iacocca. You're going to go after him?
Right.
They're all talking, I got some bitches, hoes, my prostitute. I got fucking 5 prostitutes.
Yeah, it is hard. That's a great point, man. It's harder for them because hip-hop is so... And so many things are so fucking powerful that if they go after you, everybody would look and go, what about that? And then they can't take that on because hip-hop doesn't give a fuck what right. women's groups think.
Yep.
They don't give a fuck.
So, yeah, middle-aged white woman's not going to be able to bring that down. There's no way. She's going to be looked considered racist if she goes after it. So she can't go after even the senator that whips out his dick mm-hmm. in front of a, you know, an intern.
Well, there you have it. Roland Martin, we defend his right to fucking tweet whatever yes. the fuck he wants, but... You know, we live in a strange world right now.
By the way, did you see the video? I Twittered it last night. The fucking, it's off the subject, but it's on the subject. The black guy yelling at the white guy in the parking lot?
No.
It's in Atlanta. And apparently what had happened was that they were going for the same parking spot. My take on it is that the black guy and his girlfriend probably took the parking spot from this white guy. Because the black guy's a thug. And this white guy's a fucking, just an office douche. Or, and so what happened was
we talked to a lot of those guys.
The video starts right. with the black guy screaming, "Clean my fucking shit!" What happened was, I guess that they pulled into the spot this guy was waiting for. So the guy got mad and he threw his like mocha latte or whatever on the guy's car.
Right.
And the black guy saw him do it and fucking was none too. I mean, it's a 7-minute video. You can't watch all of it, but watch like. 30 seconds of it with
I hate to admit, I spit on cars and I throw my coffee in cars in New York City. When I get cut off, when I'm crossing the street where it's really close, I lose my fucking mind. And I'm just expecting a beating. I'm not that tough.
Eventually, yeah.
But I can't take
it. What, if you're walking across the street and somebody, like, literally, your car cuts in front of you when you get the right of way?
Yeah, where you're like, what the fuck? I almost got hit. You'll spit
on the car?
I'll spit on there. I try to get their windshield so they know. Because anyone could spit on the side of a fucking car.
I spit on the tire.
I'll kick, I'll punch their car.
Oh, which man, you're fucking asking for it.
I know.
Somebody's going to come out
with that. I've thrown coffee before. Yeah. I know.
Yeah.
I'm not saying like, yeah, I know what's going to happen, but I can't help myself. It enrages me.
Yeah.
You want to see the first part of this, Jimmy? Want to do it after the break? Because we got...
Yeah, and we have Vaughn who's coming in. We're going to help promote Patrice's CD. And I would like to get a woman's point of view as well.
Oh,
on
good.
This,
yeah, yeah,
because
yeah.
this guy was with his chick. And it was first of all, people online have been split down the racial lines. The white people side with... And I think that this black guy... Well, I'll tell you what I think after. But I do have an opinion on what was happening here.
All right, I got something over here before you, eh? We go to break with this. Florentine's one-man show this weekend here in the city... I don't have a sheet in front of me. That's
Producers Club, Friday, Saturday, February 10, 11, also 17, 18.
Me and Bobby are going Friday, me and Bob Kelly.
Good. And it's different from your stand-up, obviously.
Yeah, it's a whole, it's more storytelling and stuff.
Yeah,
a lot of serious
I love storytelling.
Shit. Yeah, pictures.
Nice.
All that stuff. Get tickets at jimflorentine.com, brown tickets.
Can I have more than one? You only offered me one.
What?
I'd like to go with somebody. You said I'll get you a ticket. You said a ticket.
Well, what we're for glad? You're fucking breaking down my words?
They're going to be split, though.
Give you two.
Two tickets are going to be up front, and two are going to be in the back.
How small is this theater that you're only giving me one ticket? You want me to stand? I'll stand in the back.
I don't know. I mean, look, I can't even say it because I might want to work here one day. I'll tell you at the break. I'll get you two tickets.
You will?
Yeah.
I'll buy my tickets.
I'll stand. I want people buying tickets to your show.
No, don't worry about it.
You know what? I'll buy. Can I get two tickets? I'll buy them.
You can have two.
All right, here's my credit card. You want to take care of it online or?
We can work it out. No, I'll have a couple tickets for you.
All right, we're going to figure that out during the
break. If you don't like the show, don't fucking trash it on Monday.
That's why I don't like seeing half this shit before the person
comes
in. I
think you're going to like it. I'm confident you will.
Because I can't lie. I'm not a good liar.
It's the best thing I've done since I fucked two
Stop
nines one
me.
Night at the same time.
And by that, he means age.
All right, Vaughn's coming in next. More with Florentine, but first this.
New from Puddinhead Records, Opie and Anthony present Sitting and Singing, the Handicap Hits.
Hey, rolling with the devil. Yes, I'm rolling.
It's all the rock you know and love. Done specifically for people without leg mobility.
Cause traps like us, baby, we were born to roll.
Just because your legs don't work doesn't mean your ears don't. Just ask Van Halen.
Hey, I wish I could jump. I'm never gonna jump. Might as well just sit here.
The hits just keep rolling in.
If only they could walk.
Ah, yes. I would roll 100 miles and I would roll 500 more. But my hands would hurt because I'm rolling. Get it? I sit in the chair that you're in. Now face north. You roll around 90 degrees and still just sit here.
It's sitting and singing the handicap hits from your pals at Puddinhead Records and the Opie and Anthony Show. Sirius XM. The Opie and Anthony Show.
Yeah. Is that one of those songs? Oh, this is Peter Gabriel, isn't it?
It's sampled, but yeah.
Yeah, I hear the sample in there. The yeah. I'm sexy and I know it. Vaughn's in studio. Patrice's longtime girlfriend, wife. What the hell is going on with you?
You hit me with that immediately. You hit me right in my heart. I was so hurt. Oh, I was so hurt.
But, by me?
You know, no.
Yeah, because people are saying you're a longtime girlfriend.
Long-term girlfriend. That hit me in the gut. I mean, I have not been referred to as wife, as long-term girlfriend ever.
Right.
But, and Patrice has only addressed me as his wife probably for at least a year or two.
Right.
I have an engagement ring on both fingers. He died before we got married.
Right.
And if you want to hear the sick, disgusting story and, you know, you want to get sad, his last gig was at Caroline's. And then he had a two-week break coming up, where he was going to fly to L.A. and discuss the FX thing.
Right.
And during that two-week break, we were going to be settling everything, getting everything ready. You know, I don't want to get all the dirt out there, but nothing was in order.
Right.
And when I say nothing, I mean nothing. But we were going to use that two-week period before he went back to L.A. to get ready for December, which we were actually going to get married in Hawaii.
Wow.
And we were going back and forth. Should we, like, just do, like, the Justice of the Peace thing and then, you know, bring my daughter and his mom to Hawaii and do a family vacation and do, like, or should we do the wedding there? We were, like, talking like that. Like, we were going to do something small and then tell everyone.
Sure.
So I love the fact that you guys all definitely gave me that respect and just, you know, I've been Patrice's wife to everyone for so long. And then this is the first time I'm seeing it that way. I didn't even get fiancé.
What was it, the Rolling Stone article?
Yeah, the Rolling Stone, which, by the way,
I heard they did a good job. I got the issue, and I'm a pussy, man, and then I can't read it yet.
I can't read
the article, and I still haven't listened to the CD that everyone's raving about, the last project he was working on when he died.
It's tough, and I will say this. The article is not about me. You know, the article is fantastic for Patrice's legacy. It's four pages, a four-page tribute. Huge picture. They're talking about his entire life. I'm a tiny little ant in comparison to what the article is supposed to be about. So that little thing, yes, that hurt my feelings. But
what hurt
it's
your
not
feelings?
About me.
I just come in and we were taping something. I'm sorry.
He came on air and hit me with the long-term girlfriend title.
Oh, yeah,
and
yeah.
I almost passed out. I'm like, thanks, Opie.
Well, it's more of a joke because it's like, and I know you want to discuss it, so I figured, what the hell? Let's get into this.
Yeah, it's a joke to me, but it's hurtful because of everything that's going on. And like,
what's going on? What can you say? What's up?
Well, you know, I've only heard that term come from one person, and I don't want to, you know, say anything against anyone, but I'm not, you know, put it like this. I'm mumbling. So let me just say this. I wish that we did get married, and in my future, whatever point I'm able to move on, I will never ever be this involved in someone's life without being married sooner, because you are not protected as long-term girlfriend or even fiance. They don't recognize common law marriage in the state of New Jersey. And to keep it simple, I have not been allowed in my house
that you shared with Patrice
since probably a few days before the funeral. And, you know, Patrice and I had two households.
Right.
We had, when he bought the house, we decided to keep my apartment to keep my daughter in the school system where she was.
Right.
Until she finished.
And to let Patrice breathe every once in a while.
No, he. Well, yeah, but he didn't get much breathing room because he was either at the apartment with me
right.
or we were over there. It was literally. Oh, I didn't realize like it one
was
big place.
You know what? I didn't realize that was a school system thing. It makes sense.
It was a school system thing. That was it. And she goes to a very special school. It's hard to get into. You know, it's a performing arts school, it's an arts integrated school, but you also have to be like a really smart kid to get in and test in. She had the audition yet. She had to interview, you know, she had to meet with the principal. It was a long process. So, you know, we have to let her finish that in eighth grade.
Sure,
you
sure,
have
sure.
to live in that school district. So that's all that was about. And, you know, at this point, I'm kind of, you know, at first I was like, oh, I need to, you know, be here. Even during the funeral, I was kind of pushed out. I wasn't, you know, all of the support was going to the house. And my daughter and I were at my apartment eating ramen noodles while whatever was going on at the house.
So you haven't been allowed back in the house, and you got, like, stuff in there, right?
Of course, yeah.
Holy shit.
Of course, my daughter has stuff in there, but, you know.
I would say this, because someone has to say it. I don't know what the fuck's going on, obviously. I don't know what the hell. But I'll say this. Knowing Patrice as well as we did, he would want it differently. He would be pissed off.
Absolutely.
Patrice would be pissed off that you're not allowed to go back into that house and get your shit.
And I don't know what happened. I don't know when.
I don't know the full story, but I have to say that for Patrice. I just know.
You know what? And I don't. I'm mumbling and I'm stumbling because it's still his people.
Right.
You know, I don't want to, you know.
Did he get along with his people?
Absolutely.
You're obviously talking about Patrice's family.
Yeah,
without
absolutely.
Mentioning specific people, but right. you're talking about his family.
I don't know
and they
know
have treated
when,
you differently since he passed. Let's
almost
put it on the table.
Very moment that he passed. Because, you know, I felt 100% that I was doing the right thing by Patrice and his family the entire time he was in the hospital. I have no clue, you know, I have some clue, you know, because I've been, you know, there has been discussions, but.
Can I ask you this? Did you make a decision in the hospital that they didn't agree with or anything like that? Or can you think of anything that might have turned them? If you don't want to discuss it, by the way, I'm not going to push you.
Yeah, wherever you, whatever you don't want to go
but
into
I don't know
fine.
Where, I don't know how much you want to get. Maybe you want to vent today. I don't know.
Right.
But if you don't want to say something, that's fine by us. Trust me.
That could be possible, but I want to be careful just because I don't want to call anyone out that's not here to defend themselves.
Right.
And I don't want to make this a one-sided story.
Right.
You know, but from what I'm getting, there's no legitimate reason.
You can't
you know,
figure
even
it out.
If you've disagreed with anything, if Patrice was here, he wouldn't have it the way it is, even if there were disagreements with how things were handled. But I certainly 100% wash my hands of it because they're clean. I did nothing
right.
wrong.
What do you got in the house that you want?
At this point, I would say nothing important that I'm stressing over anymore because it's been long enough. I've made many calls, texts, emails, you know, and at first it wasn't even about getting anything because I didn't think that would be an issue at any point.
Can't they put it in a box at least and say, hey, it'll be out on the curb at 10 a.m.?
There are memories there that no one would understand why I would want.
Right.
You know, it's not as simple as give me my guitar or give me my daughter's stuffed animals out of the closet.
Which are things, by the way, because I've heard. Stuffed animals that Patrice gave your daughter are still in the house that your daughter, I would assume, want. And you have a special guitar that you like that's still there.
There's a lot of things there that I would like. I mean, all the artwork on the wall, the pictures on the wall, we picked out on the streets of Brazil. You know, we picked those out.
So it would be nice to have one of those.
It would be nice to have anything at
right.
this point. But I'm so back and forth with that now. It's like it hurts so much to even imagine. That was part of the article that I couldn't stomach is reading how everything is being packed up. And I'm like, what's being packed up?
There's a lot of that stuff you got with Patrice or is your stuff.
But at the end of the day, It's not, because we were not technically married, and I will take a small portion of the blame for that. You know, Patrice, you can't push him, but so far, you know, but when he was finally ready, he did pass away before it actually happened. But technically, you know, next of kin is next of kin. So if I'm long-term girlfriend and those things don't belong to me anymore, then I have to separate myself from it and take a deep breath.
It's really sad. I don't know the other side of the story, obviously, but I'm going to say it again. Knowing Patrice like we did, there's no way he'd want it to go down like this. There's no way.
It's a really...
There's no way.
From what I see, it seems like with such a sudden death, and it was such a... It was just all of a sudden, you're watching television, and the next thing you know, a rock has come through your window. Like, it was that... I think that people sometimes don't know what to do. They don't know how to handle it. They don't know how to make sense of it.
Sure.
And I don't know. I think for a while, I think when people are just trying to actually see what has happened, blame starts. And that might be human nature, where you just start blaming. I don't know. I can't speak for anybody, but I don't think it's an evil intent, but it seems like...
Something going on, though.
It's a horrible, horrible thing that happened. And how do you make sense of it? You got to find something to blame, and to blame nature doesn't make sense, because nature you can't see. You can't put a face on it. Does that make any sense?
Right. Yeah. It's, you know, when something like that happens, there's a lot of emotions that are really raw. No one's thinking straight. And then somebody gets in somebody's ear, and that's what sets it off. Yeah. Somebody says something like, hey, you know, that stuff could be whatever. You know, maybe you should keep that in the house. And then that's where somebody puts something in somebody's ear while they're friggin', you know, their emotions are all over the place. Really, you think so? Yeah, you never know. And then that's it. And then everything gets shut down. I went through a similar situation with an ex that passed away.
Right.
With the family, all of a sudden, you know, come out of the woodwork and, hey, this is mine, this is mine, this is this, right. this, and all
that stuff.
And I've
been being accused of having things that don't even exist.
Yeah, like, exactly. Yeah,
like jewelry. All these, yeah. It's like, I don't care about a watch.
Right.
You know, and it's like, if I'm being accused of these little things, it's like I've given you, I even had things at the apartment that I've given back. And I'm like, I don't have whatever it is that you're looking for. I hope you find it, but I don't have it.
Oh, like, so they might think you, wow.
Well, let me just say this. Patrice and I were very close, obviously, but I also worked with him with everything.
Right.
From business to personal.
Right.
So, obviously, if someone is feeling mistrustful of you for whatever reason, they may feel like you're hiding something.
Oh, I gotcha.
And it's like, I had access to an account that, you know, was basically our account, you know, with PIN codes and everything that I had in my wallet. You know, I made that known. You know, if I was going to be sneaky, I would have been sneaky. I'm from the hood. I know how to be sneaky. You know, I grew up in the projects. I'm not a sneaky person. And here's my thing. Patrice, if you think that I'm so fucking magical, that the great Patrice O'Neill, who can see through everyone on earth in about 5 seconds and sum them up and know their character, how magical am I that I pulled the wool over Patrice's eyes for 10 years? I'm really a bad person.
I have a thought. Do you think that they think that Patrice had more money than he had?
Probably.
Yeah.
And people who are... That's an assumption.
Yeah, but that's the funny thing about, you know, comedians. Like, you just assume these guys have a lot of money, and the fact is they don't.
Dude, they're saying Gary Busey is worth under 50 grand. Now, that might be a paperwork issue. I don't know what his personal life is. But a lot of times people
Patrice
don't have
did
what
well,
you think.
But he also spent like a mother hugger.
Right. And people who are not in the business don't. People who are not in the entertainment business.
Motherfucker.
Yeah. But people who aren't in the business tend to think that, you know, people see you on TV, they think you have money.
Right.
You know,
so maybe they just assume that he had more, and there's some account or something, and then you got it first, and that's pissing. Something's going on.
It's something.
Because in all fairness, you know, and to be honest, I met, you know, Patrice's family, and I thought they were really nice people. So, you know, I believe what you're saying. Trust me. And once again, because I think it's really important, Patrice would want this differently than how it's going down. that is no doubt in my mind. And you got to think some of that has to come into play where they sit.
And it's hard to watch because I'm not being diplomatic. I really do love Vaughn, and I really do love his family. Like I really do care about all of them.
Yeah, I agree with you.
And it's very difficult to see people in any type of horrible tragedy not just getting together, you know, because you want everybody to feel as good as you can feel. You want everybody to move on and begin to live again. And you don't want any type of a strife with it because it's hard to watch people you care about dealing with that.
Are they mad about the special deal that was made for Mr. P and the thing we did with Audible with Patrice's material? Because I'll tell you right now where I sit, there was no doubt in my mind that's how the deal should have been set up, where you get some of that money because...
At this point, because
we knew that's
know.
What Patrice would have wanted. Simple
right.
as that.
I don't know at this point. It's been so long that I've had any communication with anyone.
You haven't talked to Patrice's family since the funeral?
I've tried.
Since the funeral, that
I've
was
tried.
It?
I've tried. Afterwards, there were some... it was more of a slow blow-off, I would say. You know, there...
Florentine's shaking his head. Yes, he understands this, huh?
We talked about this. We have very similar stories.
Really?
Yeah, well, I must say, the last time I saw you guys were in Atlantic City.
Right.
And that was actually harder for me than the funeral itself because it was the first time I was at an event where, you know, I would not necessarily be without Patrice.
Right.
And all of you guys, and it was very, very hard.
At the end, everybody has something to do and somewhere to go or a person to talk to or someone
right.
to see.
And, Jim, you don't know this, but I ended up at dinner with Opie and his wife. I don't know if you know this,
was that the shitty dinner you were talking about? No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding.
It was me, my wife, Voss, and Bonnie. We invited, you know.
Oh, I didn't know you went to that.
I went to that, yeah, and I thought you were coming.
I was going to.
And you couldn't make it, so I'm sitting there with the two couples and this big-ass empty chair.
Oh. Which made it worse, and this is, in a way, twisted funny. There's a spotlight basically in the on the empty seat.
You know
how restaurants
that?
Have lights? Yeah, of course I did. As soon as if you're going to talk about it, she got up crying and we're like, we felt so bad. And
I
then
couldn't
Voss
even
is
order
like,
my tea, drink my tea. I didn't even
of
make
course.
It to order.
And then we tried to like get rid of the chair, the setting, everything. So now it looked like more of a normal, you know, five. Person table type of situation.
Right.
But it was too late. This light, you know how restaurants have their lights, but this particular light was shining on the empty fucking seat.
And not only is it because Patrice is gone, everybody in the restaurant thinks you've been stood up. And, I was in my agent's room with Florentine. I went and it was with Pete watching the game.
You know what it was too? I was imagining if he was there, you know, you guys were talking, you and right. Voss, and you guys were doing what you
and
do,
and shit.
I hear Patrice's...
What he would have said.
And everything. So I'm just
in
like...
In other words, you heard, shut up, dummy, a million times.
And then everything just became, like, too much, and I'm like, I have to go to the bathroom. And then I was in the bathroom so long that Bonnie came in there after me, like, I told her, I can't come back to the table. Please apologize for me. This is too much. I feel like an asshole. That was the first time.
And Voss might have said while you were gone that you're a buzzkill, but...
Yes, I knew that. I knew that,
no,
and I was
kidding.
Trying. No, I'm not realistic. I'm like, I am going to ruin dinner.
No, Voss would have said that to be funny. He's not... Even Rich is not that
fucked
up.
You got to understand, that was just a joke. We wanted you to stay so fucking bad.
Yeah, nobody wanted
you. We were trying to figure out how we could get that done.
Let me tell you, I never stopped crying.
I know.
I never stopped crying. That was the first time I was unable to control my emotions in front of people.
Right.
Because normally I'm like this. And I started that way even in a hospital. I don't cry in front of Patrice. Don't cry in front of his mom. Don't cry in front of your kid. That was my mentality. Stay strong. You know,
right.
Handle everything how Patrice would do it. And I feel like I did that as best as I could. And Patrice said to me, a long time ago, you know, if anyone ever accuses you of anything that you know you're not doing or you know it's not you as your characteristic, wash your hands of it because you better know that what they're accusing you of is what they're doing to you
right.
or they're going to do to you.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm starting to feel that and experience that and know that. And that's all I really have to go off of. And, you know, I won't get into too many more full details about any of it
right
at this point until I see what happens, because I don't know where anything is.
More importantly, is that cherry red?
The lipstick?
It's coral. Thank you.
Yeah, I have a side view of the dress. It's very uncomfortable. I'm looking at Florentine's fucking giant chin.
And the beautiful red lips are driving me nuts.
Thank you.
But what did you say? I haven't even heard a word you said.
By the way, every single time you see me, it'll be the same thing. I don't own any other type of clothing.
No, it's fine.
There's something wrong with women with big boobs that
cover
up. Those
doors open at the apartment just to get Morty's clothes out.
Really?
I'll fucking break down the door. No, wait. Stuff like that.
Well, we were in Atlantic City, and we're talking, and he's telling me his story, and I'm loving Florentine to death. He gives me this big man hug, and
you want to feel your boobies.
Yeah.
Mind you,
I know Florentine a little bit.
He gives me those hugs, but from the back.
Let me console you. Yeah. I need to console you.
I know. Come here.
Me and you, we've been
lost my lover, my best friend, but also my lover. I've not been touched in 1,000 years. I'm like, yeah, you're getting married in July. You're going to have to get away from me. I'm like, oh, this hug is great.
Yeah, I just gave a little pat on the ass. I'm like, on your way.
Then I'm like in Atlantic City, like, someone else hug me. Where's Jim? Hug me. Where's Opie? Hug me. Where's anyone? Hug me.
I got a nice squeeze in today. It's nice.
Well, you I'm know. All over.
Do you know how much? Do you know how much you would have regretted banging Florentine? That would have been the worst fucking 15 seconds of this.
Yeah, I mean, you know, of course, just because of Patrice, I just couldn't. Yeah. It would be really bad.
People confused. Yeah, Von's getting some proceeds because that's the deal we set
up. Yes,
because that's what Patrice wanted. They're asking, so I want. And the other side, I'm mad, but I think Patrice wouldn't want anyone to pick sides. You know. I don't know.
Right,
I don't know what's going on. It's really confusing to me because what I saw from Patrice's family, I'm very surprised by this. And I don't know.
For the record, that's why I don't want to speak on all the gory details, because I don't want anyone to pick sides either.
Right.
And I don't want it to be a bashing on the other side, because Patrice wouldn't want that either.
Hell fucking
at the
no.
end of the day, you know, I know where his heart is, and it's on both sides, and that's fine with me. Well, you know, I'm hurt, and I'll figure it out, but I don't want this to become a thing.
In a perfect world, what do you want right now?
I don't know, Opie. I want everything to be okay.
I want to
fast forward to life being okay.
You would like to go in that house and maybe be able to you know, get a few things.
Yes. I will say yes, but talk
like human beings, like, okay, I really want that picture because this is
why. It's been my experience that I can talk like human beings, and then it seems like it'll be okay, and then 5 minutes later, it's back to the same thing. And back to accusations and back to distance.
Death is exhausting. So much of an up.
It is exhausting.
Death is exhausting.
You know what happens?
Can you
the worst
imagine
part
living
is the funeral?
And then I have to explain it to
can't
my
live
kid.
Death.
The family comes out of the woodwork afterwards to try to control the situation.
And a lot of times it's not the immediate family who is close.
Right. It's other people. It's cousins, it's uncles, it's all this stuff. People that could never control that person when they were alive, all of a sudden when they're gone, now they want complete control. They move in.
Right.
And I'm making all the decisions. Fuck you, everybody out of my way.
Right. Right. And
too bad. They don't know anything. They don't know a lot of things that went on in their personal life. But all of a sudden, they're experts. And all of a sudden, there was all this stuff there.
And Jim dealt with that for a long time. I remember when you were going through that. It was awful.
I was
very inspired talking to Florentine because he's doing better.
No one's ever said that before.
I know, that's the first time it's ever been said.
The first time those words have ever been said together in a row.
Florentine, make a plaque.
Because I was
standing. Get that plaque hung up.
I'm standing in Atlantic City like a crying, bumbling fool. I could not control myself at all. Even your wife, Opie, helped me through Atlantic City a lot. I love her. I latched on to her. I latched on to Florentine. His story was so similar. And to know that he's about to get married, I'm like so happy. It's like, I can't even see the possibility. Who, what, where, why, and how is going to, you know, come into my life. It's hard to see, even if I can see it.
Let me tell you a little story about Greg Opie Hughes. I'm not supposed to be here because my dad's high school sweetheart died at 26 years old.
Wow.
And he certainly didn't want her to die.
Wow.
I look at death very differently because I'm here because of a horrendous tragedy in my dad's life. And he he, even when he had six of us and we, me and my dad would go out drinking, I would finally get him to talk about it. He would break down in tears like it happened yesterday still. Happy that we were here, happy, you know, with my mom.
Right.
But the fact remains that he never wanted his high school sweetheart to die. But wow. Then was ended up happy with his life. He says right. He looks at it like two different lives.
Right. And Norton had talked me through some of those moments with, like, you know, saying, you know, the Kennedy story he gave me. Like, I've been inspired.
I don't remember what that was.
You told the Kennedy story?
I think I said
you were saying something
could
about
be worse. We could be in Dallas.
Yeah. Could be 1963. No, and
she saw her husband's face shot off, and then she moved on and got married.
Oh, how Jacqueline Onassis.
Yeah. Well, money.
Eventually moved on, yeah.
Money cures all woes.
Well, she had.
Well, I'll keep that in mind when I'm looking for a new husband,
although,
I guess.
If you can get a Greek shipping magnet, you just take it.
They had on the news today, JFK was worth $1 billion. So how much more money did the fucking tycoon have?
Well, let me tell you, Patrice was not worth $1 billion. And, you know, I'm not in the greatest of positions right now, but it'll be fine eventually. I will figure it out. I'm still alive, and I still have a kid and two dogs to take care of.
An amazing
it's
kid.
It's her birthday this weekend. Wish her happy
birthday. How old is she?
She's going to be officially 13.
I thought she was 14. Wow, she's 12.
Oh, no, she was 12.
She's very smart.
Yeah.
Yeah, she's an amazing kid.
She spoke at the wake. She was very composed.
I think we're going to see some good stuff from her down the road.
Yeah, very bright. Obviously, really well-spoken for a 12-year-old. Like, Jesus. For a 12-year-old to communicate that well under brutal circumstances was very impressive.
Well, yeah, I was terrified. She's like, because I'm telling her who's going to be there, and, you know, you guys are speaking, and, you know, Kevin's speaking, she's like, I love Kevin Hart, and she's like a big fan, and I'm like, are you going to be able to, like, they're talking, and then you're going to go up and talk, and at first she was supposed to go first, and then they made her go last. I'm like, you're headlining. Yeah. Oh, God, no.
But by the way, that was very nice what Vaughn just did. Here's what really happened. She didn't mention, the kid said, Kevin Hart is speaking, and she went, yes, but Vaughn just threw us in to be polite. Yeah, yeah. Like, you know, no, I said, you guys are talking, and she's like, who gives, fuck them. Who cares about those middles?
No, but she already knows you guys, and I was really impressed that she wasn't like, oh, I love you. She just said, hello, Mr. Hart. How are you? I'm one of you. You know, she's very mature. She wasn't like freaked out about anything.
And she's taller than Kevin, right? At 12 years old.
I think so. At a 12-year-old girl.
And her act is better.
Yeah. You know,
it's I was more worried about Voss saying something stupid than her. But Voss was the X factor. If anybody was going to trip up and ruin everybody's day, it was going to be him. But he was great.
You guys were amazing.
Yeah. He started off. It goes, I just want to let you know, I'll be selling my CDs outside the church.
Yeah. It's like, Jesus, now?
And Colin opened up by slamming me, because I talked right before Colin, and it was great. It was like, it just made me really happy to be a comic at that moment. I had read a couple of fan emails I had gotten from people that Patrice helped, or whatever. And one was from a woman who had breast cancer and whatever, and Colin made fun of me for reading part of the email that said she was friends with Eddie Brill. And he's like, did you have to mention that she was friends with Eddie Brill? And it's like, could you have edited that part out? And the fucking place exploded. It was such an honest, funny thing to open with. And he was right. Stupid asshole I am. Not editing.
So here's the deal. Patrice O'Neill's article, his article in Rolling Stone magazine came out. Who's on the cover? Because people are asking.
The cast of The Voice. Christina Aguilera and the other guys from The Voice.
But it's the latest one on newsstands right now. Because I couldn't find the magazine. I haven't bought Rolling Stone in so long, and they don't sell it anywhere.
It's smaller now. It's regular magazines.
Right.
Yeah, it's the regular
size.
It's
unbelievable, though.
Yeah.
A lot of the newsstands just don't carry it.
Yeah.
I used to get Rolling Stone every freaking month.
I don't have a copy. The record label, Jason from the record label who's produced the album, sent me his copy, a scanned copy of it. And it is very hard.
Couldn't you send you a whole copy of the cheapskate?
I think he got it. He was you know, so it was more like that. Mm. And it is difficult. But again, I want to make sure I'm saying again, it is a great article. And I'm so grateful to Rolling Stones for doing that for Patrice. Is definitely not about the long term girlfriend thing. That's, you know, honestly, that hurt my feelings. But it's up to them to report accurately. So it should have been fiance technically. But you know, fine. The article is fantastic for his legacy.
Right.
And I appreciate it. And, you know, to answer your question specifically about the house, I'm at a place where I'm so afraid to go over there at this point. I don't know how I will be able to handle it mentally, because at this point I've been forced to put my mind in a place where you start just writing things off and going, okay, you know, if you're not, how are you going to live if you never get to go over there and get any memory or anything? And then you get yourself into that place, and then you have to go backwards to go into the house. I don't even know what to do. I don't know what I want at this point. I just want everything to be okay and everybody to be okay.
Right. I want to clear up something. Somebody's asking me on Twitter.
What's Twitter?
It's a really fun social networking site, which really? Can apparently get you fired if you work for the news. But this is not what Vaughn is saying, and I want to clear this up because I don't want...
Listen, what half it... It's
people just don't
sometimes.
Hear what
listen.
People... This guy tweets me, and he's being well-intentioned. He goes, the money donated goes to her or his family. I'd rather money go to Vaughn than his greedy family.
I'm sorry.
No. Is not... what is being said. And again, we're not being diplomatic or polite. No one is saying that Patrice's family is being greedy. That's not at all an issue. It's not, they want to steal every, no one is saying that. There's just...
I'm not saying that
no
either.
No one.
I'm saying I don't know why I've been alienated in certain aspects. I don't know. We were all just speculating because that's what you do when you don't know.
Right.
I think it's more emotional stuff, but it's not about. I'm being very honest when I say I love Vaughn and I love Patrice's family, and I wouldn't love Patrice's family if they were greedy, awful people. It's not about that.
Right.
At all. So I know you're asking an honest question, Vinny, on Twitter, but. For real, that's not what's happening.
Well, I mean, the deal we made with Audible and the deal with the record company is what it is, right? It was written that way.
It's for everybody, and everybody
so,
signed off on it.
Yeah, so
if they were greedy, they wouldn't have signed off
on
it.
Yeah, so Vaughn's money's not going to be fucked with that
at all. And Patrice's family had to say yes to that. Vaughn had to say yes to that. Everybody said yes to that. That wasn't
right.
some...
And
they weren't forced to say yes to that. They wanted to.
And the part we hit, you know... We were involved with that a little bit, and we just knew, say it again, that's what Patrice wanted.
Yeah, we're helping.
That's obvious.
And the bottom line is this, we don't know 100% because it wasn't written down. It's almost like when, you know, Patrice was a comic genius, certain paperwork he should have done better. You know, I wish he would have.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So what happens is all these people who loved him are left to try to figure out how do we do this to best represent. I'm talking about his friends as opposed to family and Vaughn. How do we represent what we think our friend would have wanted? You're not a mind reader. You can only do what you think is fair
right.
and go here and here.
Right.
I love you
right.
and I love you and he loves all of you.
Which is what he would have done anyway.
I know it is.
It's not black and white.
No, we don't know.
But
he didn't leave us a map.
You could have a general idea, which I think we all have. I think it would be fun to just like not have a will and just let... family members just
duke it out.
Let me tell you.
Just duke it out like vultures. But as long as you're able to see from wherever the fuck you go, if you go
right,
anywhere.
Just laugh about it.
Oh, how much fun would that
you
be?
If Patrice
they're all
can see from
right.
where he is. He is not.
Not happy
if there
it.
Is a heaven and hell and he's watching this, he's probably more in hell.
How do I put this carefully? Did they find the dildos?
I would imagine so. There's one in every freaking drawer.
Maybe they were bothered by the amount of dildos.
They're his dildos. I'm not into dildos. Zillions.
Well, it's.
I'm not into.
This is based on a famous story. When we got back to radio, Patrice came in all excited with a briefcase, and we're like, "What is he doing?" And he just opened up this briefcase of dildos, and then pulled each one out and told us about each individual
dildo.
He had a glass one, he had a double dong one, he had big ones, small ones, vibrating ones.
He was really into putting things into me and others. But me personally, I would never
That's
use
funny.
A dildo.
Well, maybe they're blaming you for the dildos. Let's get it on record.
Then Yvonne has nothing to do with the dildos. They've never met Patrice O'Neill.
You mean the fact that the family was grieving, looking for an ice cream scooper, and they open the fucking thing, yeah, and there's a giant green dildo?
Wherever they look, under the couch, and Patrice.
It's funny.
Behind the bed.
Because yeah, I mean, I could see that. You know, the family's looking for a will, and then all of a sudden they open the door, and it's three dildos.
Yeah.
I would say the only reason they would be surprised is if they've never met him.
Yeah.
Like, how can you be surprised at anything like that? I mean, come on.
Do you understand what it was like to be in Brazil with him when we would have to fuck?
Yes,
and
I
you
do.
Know, you do. You were there.
I absolutely do.
He would go down and take his bag up. It was just so embarrassing.
We took more stuff for the Brazilian hookers than we took for ourselves there. I mean, you're talking about lingerie and panties and clothes and you know, happy dildos and everything.
It's hence why Patrice didn't have money when he died.
Yeah,
for a lot of it. Yeah. He's too busy buying hookers' panties.
Dildos and dildos. Plain fare.
Right. Well, he's very generous.
It's all jokes. You know we love him.
Oh, you never have to tell me it's a joke. I know. I'm joking with you.
Right, he, right, that bag was fucking...
He had to bring the bag upstairs.
Somebody he would bring awful. A bag to Brazil of dildos.
Do you understand? I had to go through customs with him.
Really?
We're all guys, and he's got a bag of dildos.
Well, imagine how they look at me.
Yeah.
Like,
they probably thought that it was your request.
Did they give you any good looks, Jimmy?
I avoided the line. I went into a different line. I'm like, I'm not going through with you.
I can't deal
fucking
with this.
Dicks and fucking sex toys in a third world country, you creep. And then he would go, the lockers were on the ground floor.
Right.
And then you go up one floor, and it was where the bar area where you would hang out and you would meet the girls. They would put a number on you, and then you would go up to the third floor. And that was where the bedrooms were. And you show the number to somebody up there, they write it down so they know what girl, because there's no money exchanged in the actual place until at the end. So what happened was we'd be on the second floor in the bar area. Patrice would meet somebody, and then I would go up with my girl, and of course he would have to fucking truck down in the elevator, take his bag of dildos, up two more flights to the third floor, do what he did, then go down three floors, and then come back up to the it was fucking exhausting. It was exhausting. I'm like, where were you? And he's like, I had to go down, and of course I was taking fucking Viagra, so I wouldn't come until the end of the night. It was just obnoxious.
He has an
was
incredible extra? Amount of patience for that.
Was it extra with the dildos?
I don't know. Probably not.
No?
Probably not. I fucked one girl without a rubber twice.
What's wrong?
What?
A lot. Yeah, I know.
What?
And she kept going, you special. No. I was like, oh, thank you.
Did you come? Something. I remember that they do talk really, really sexy. And
yeah, I didn't like the
Portuguese languages.
I don't like that. I like that. Really? Now that I know what boca means, I like that. I like boca. But I like I like English.
Like
boca. Yeah, boca. I like English.
Yeah. Yes. Did you come when you didn't have a condom on?
Faster, yeah, much faster.
Where?
Well, you know.
I can't believe that.
What is she
going to
do,
crazy.
Track me down?
I can't believe you did that. That yeah. I thought they were more like just accessories in the room.
I would love to think there's a Brazilian version of Jim Norton somewhere right now.
Some guy blinking too much with a weak chin, being beaten up in fucking mixed martial arts.
You are insane.
Living on some roof somewhere.
Yeah.
Now, is this living proof, like my theory last time I was on, about heterosexual male AIDS? If you go to Brazil and fuck a hooker without a condom, come inside of her, and this guy's still clean, there you go.
Well, let's hope I am. I haven't been tested since.
No, you were tested.
Yeah, of course.
Thus there all you the go. Blinking.
There you go.
There you go.
Nervous. God, I wish there was a little Brazilian Norton.
That would be great.
Can we track him down?
Sure.
What would happen, seriously, if like someone came forward or whatever, this hooker somehow tracked you down, knew you were a comedian, and said, you got a four-year-old daughter right now, what would you do? Would you bring her here? Like, how would you handle that? Would you just send money over there and never see her?
Would you put her in the will?
She probably would be happy with $100. That would do the job, probably.
Yeah, would I bring her here? Probably not. I think culturally the mother and I would argue. But I had to go out and do a gig and she was fucking guys for $11.
Damn.
So I would probably not have an issue with that.
Well,
I would have an issue with that.
Where would little Brazilian Jimmy be while she's doing that?
I don't know.
In the playroom of your building?
I wouldn't know that was really my kid. Unless
You would know.
Unless there was proof.
Yeah.
And I don't see myself submitting to a Brazilian DNA test. Because I don't
Jim,
think
I
it,
love you.
Can it go from country to country or no? Paternity? I don't think it can.
Oh, God.
She's not then again, she might be a U.S. citizen. I don't know how that works legally.
You should look into it just in case.
Yeah, I really should.
You wouldn't let the kid live in your apartment.
I wouldn't let the kid visit my apartment.
Rip down your Kiss posters in your bedroom?
She would just keep pointing and asking questions I didn't understand. They'd probably be plotting to have me kidnapped and fucking murdered. Absolutely not. Absolutely not.
I was scared. I thought I would get kidnapped there. You know, they thought I was a hooker in Brazil. They thought I was one of the Brazilian hookers, but I didn't know that for like the first 2 or 3 days because Patrice spoke a little Portuguese and he would talk to some of the guys and I kept hearing the same phrase over and over. And quantos custos or something like that. And I'm like, what are you saying? Because you guys are having this conversation. Then you'll look at me and then you'll laugh. I'm like, what is this? He's like, you don't want to know. You don't want to know. Finally, I'm like, no, I want to know. What are they saying? And it's like, well, they're asking me how much does it cost to keep me for so long? Because they keep seeing me with the same hooker over and over and over. And they want to know when I'm letting you go so they can get you. And I'm like,
the girls.
No, me. They thought
I
was a hooker.
Right, the girls thought you were a hooker, right.
And I'm like, he said after that, I became really loud and obnoxious in restaurants because I would order very loud and ghetto-ly. I want a Pepsi. And he's like, just put Americana t-shirt on your forehead. Tattoo it. I'm Americana. Because I'm like, I'm not a hooker.
Oh,
like,
you
I'm so
know,
insulted.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I'm like, damn, you think I'm Brazilian?
It is scary, ooh, though, right there. It is scary because the threat of violence is always
right there.
Oh, we walked one block from Help, it was called Helpy.
Yeah.
We were at the Copacabana, Orthon or something, Orthon?
I just remember Helpy.
Yeah, it was right next door. We were a block away.
I don't
away.
Know the, yeah, yeah, that's
Rio
the restaurant
Orthon
where, yeah.
Is where, at the hotel we stayed at. And, no, that was, Mia Pataca was the restaurant, the outdoor
but isn't
restaurant.
That, like, right there?
Next to Help, right. So, we were walking back one, a block, and we got kind of surrounded by these Brazilian kids. And what happened was Patrice had scolded some older kid was making a younger kid come over and beg from us. And Patrice called him out and goes, no, you're begging for him. No, you all give money to him. I won't. So the other guy got mad and came back with a couple of people.
Shit.
This was about 11 o'clock at night. And there was a guy whose job it was to shoo the locals away. His job was to shoo them away from the tourists outside of Help. He was a security guy.
Because they're spending money, man.
Yeah, and he was like, but they didn't give a fuck. He would kick the kids. Get the fuck, you know.
Oh.
Really?
But they were hardcore.
See, I saw some really sad.
Now, this wasn't
kids,
sad. These were aggressive. Like, you know, pickpockets.
Yeah, no, I didn't see those guys.
He knew. And so we got kind of surrounded a little bit. And one of the guys shook our hands. Like, he shook our we didn't know. So we shook his hand. It was me, Keith, Bobby, Patrice, and then the guy put his finger in his nose and tried to shake Patrice's hand, I think. Patrice was like, no, I'm not shaking your... No. And Patrice knew something was wrong, and I think we saw the other guy, and we kind of knew, but I don't remember how it got diffused. We just walked back while they kind of were around us talking shit, but we were only going one block. Had we been going down side streets, we probably would have had a major problem. Because they were 15 or 14 didn't mean that they weren't fucking having ability. But we were in such a public area between Helpe and the Rio Othon that there just wasn't enough room for them to operate and do something terrible and still be able to come back. Like, you know what I mean? It was
right,
like,
right.
It probably just wasn't worth them having a major problem right there. So but we got very
wow.
lucky.
Yeah,
but that was scary. That was
scary.
Really fucking frightening.
How many kids were there?
I don't remember.
Like 10?
Yeah, Bobby or Keith might remember better. I don't remember. No, I don't think it was 10. It might have been 4 or 5. But there's so many people around. You're in a very strange world where everybody speaks the language and you don't. And you don't know who's with who because everybody's looking. It's a very fucking isolated feeling. And I think even Keith, Keith is a fucking psychopath, but even he knew that there was a problem happening that you didn't want to, we wanted to avoid as opposed to deal with.
Shit.
If I remember correctly, it's been 9 years now, or 10 years, so I don't remember exactly what happened.
Wow. Oof. Scary.
By the way, did we introduce you yet?
Who are you?
Do you don't know who Joe is?
No.
Joe Lozon.
Who is he?
Grab the mic. I thought we introduced you before. Is this your first time here? I'm such a dick. I've invited Joe many times to come and watch the show. He's a big Opie and Anthony fan. And I met him at UFC. Dana loves Joe. You just tell people what you did. Sorry to change the subject.
I've seen you before, but I don't know who you are, what you do.
About a year ago, I was on the subway, and I got attacked by Maxim Gelman, who had killed four people the night before. He attacked me, and I took him down and held him there for the cops.
Wait, who's this guy?
Guy killed four people with a knife. He was a psychopath.
Downtown?
That was wasn't that the Russian guy from Brooklyn?
Yeah.
He killed his wife or his girlfriend and the mother?
Yeah, girl he was stalking. And her mom, and he killed his stepfather, and he hit two people with cars. One of them died, and one of them didn't. So he stabbed three people to death and ran over one other person.
And then you got involved?
Well, I was on the subway going to work one day, and I'm just sitting there. And Opie, it was the day after the Islanders played Pittsburgh, that revenge game when they beat the shit out of them.
Oh,
and they
that scored was a nine great goals. Fucking game.
So I'm working on only a couple hours sleep.
Right.
And I'm just sitting on the subway waiting to go to work, and this guy's pacing the train, and the cops are on the train looking for him. Long story short, he whips out 8-inch cooking knife and tells me I'm going to die, and lunges at me, cuts me here.
You're the guy that got cut?
Yeah, yeah.
And I know who you are.
Yeah.
You were in the paper.
Yeah.
And you're a fan of our show?
Oh, big fan.
I told you he's a big fan.
Why are you always surprised when someone is a fan of the show?
And I've been telling him because Dana loves him.
I'm more excited that he's a fan of our show.
Oh, huge.
Dana White
huge.
Loves him.
Holy fuck, I remember you.
And I see him every UFC we way. Talk.
Big fan of that metal show, too.
Awesome, man.
Yeah, you were in the paper, man. Yeah, he sliced you, but then you took him down.
Yeah, I took him down with a single leg. And while I was taking him down, he carved up the back of my head a little bit.
Yeah.
And,
you take martial arts?
Never.
Oh,
I'm going
no.
to. I'm going to.
Oh, you just grabbed his leg and brought him down.
Yeah, I mean, I've been watching it since 93. So I guess if you watch it that long, you know, shit just stays in your head. So.
Oh, what were you thinking when that happened? I never asked you that.
When it's funny because when he takes the knife out, it kind of happens in slow motion. Because the first thing I noticed was how dirty the knife was. And you just look at the blade and it has something on it. And I didn't know what it was, if it was blood or dirt. And actually what I was thinking of was my wife and kids. Like, I got to get off this train because now we're in the tunnel. We're not even at a stop. We're in between Penn and 42nd. So we're in the tunnel and I'm going, all right, it's on. But I'm really thinking I have to get off this train, so I'm going to bleed to death.
Were there other people on the train?
The car was, the car was full. There were two cops in with the driver. And there were more people in the car when it happened than when I got up. Everyone had, a lot of people had run to the second car.
Had anybody helped you?
One person helped me. His name's Alfred Douglas. Once I got up and I was sitting there just bleeding to death, this man came over and he helped the police officers handcuff him and restrain him. And then he got up and he started actually yelling at the other people on the train. Nobody's going to help this guy. He's bleeding to death. How can nobody help this guy? And he came over and he just put his hand on my biggest wound back here. And then someone gave him tissues and he basically stayed with me, you know, and tried to calm me down and everything. But he's a godsend.
How many stitches in the end?
Total, I'm not sure. I got in the big wound behind my ear here. I got 20 stitches and 18 staples just in the one. But I have four or five other wounds. So I would say stitches and staple wise, you're probably talking over 100.
Fuck, you were bleeding to death.
Yeah. Why do you think he went after you? I mean, you're a big guy.
Yeah, why of all people would he pick the fucking bald guy with the goatee and tattoos?
I'm sitting here looking at him like, what the fuck?
I honestly, like the old joke is he went after the ugliest guy on the train, but I think I was just in the right. He tried to get in to the driver, and I was basically on the other side of the door where the driver drives the train. I might have just been in the wrong spot. I think he might have gone after anyone if they were sitting in that spot.
So he looked at you and said, did you engage him or say anything to him or no?
No, once he, basically he starts banging on the driver's door, and I don't know if he knew the cops were in there or not, and he basically told
him. How long did it take the cops to come out?
a little too long. Long enough for him to butcher my head.
Why the fuck didn't they come right out?
You know, I don't know. And they were on the train specifically looking for him. They were in there looking for him, and basically what he did was, if you've been on the subway in the first car, you know that the door where the driver is, there's a window. And when I first noticed him, he's banging on the window saying, let me in, I'm the police. And I heard the police officer on the other side go, you're not the police. And it was calm. He just walked away. As he walks away, there's a guy standing next to me, and he goes to the door. Now, he's banging on the window, but he's banging on the window looking over his shoulder. And I'm like looking around going, what the fuck is going on? I just got to get to work, you know? And they still didn't come out.
They were scared.
Possibly.
I think they were scared.
So then the second guy that's banging on the window keeps looking over his shoulder, waiting to see when this guy's going to walk back up. And just as he started to walk back up, the guy next to me, he just bolts from the door, stands right back next to me. And as Gelman is walking back up to the door, I don't know if he's going to try to get in again, but it's just like he stopped. He was maybe 2 or 3 feet from me and just takes out the knife and tells me I'm going to die.
Oh. He said that?
Wow.
Yeah, he said, you're going to die, you're going to die.
Where did he get you first, in the face?
He got me here first, right under my left eye.
Mm-hmm. And then what?
He got me here, then I went in for the single leg, and while my right shoulder was into his, say, midsection, he's got his right hand going like this to the back
of
my head.
Was he a big guy? He was a big guy, right?
He was probably 6'1", maybe 180.
Okay.
He looks a little chubbier now in the pictures I've seen of him in jail, but basically he's carving me up by my ear and behind my head while I'm taking him down. Then when I took him down, he still has the knife in his right hand, and he's flailing up. So the first time he flailed up, he caught me in the thumb. He sliced my thumb to the tendon. The second time he flailed up, he sliced me on the tricep.
Now, are you feeling pain at this thing, or is the adrenaline?
No, right now I'm not feeling anything. Finally, the third time he's trying to cut me, I catch his wrist and I slam it down. And when I slam it down, he drops a knife.
And nobody went over and helped while he was on the ground and you were trying to... I mean, no. It's easy for me to say it, but...
No.
But, and the cops knew what he looked like, obviously, because he started in Brooklyn and was going. So the cop in there obviously knew that was the guy when he's like, you're not the cops. Yeah. Why didn't he come out right then?
I don't know.
Why wouldn't the cop walk out when someone's banging on the thing saying, I'm the police?
Well, the funny thing is, I live in, I'm back on Long Island now. I used to live in Philadelphia. So when this happened, I was in Philadelphia. I hadn't seen a New York paper that day. So I'm on the train. Citizens in New York knew what was going on because it was big news here. I had no idea. So that's why what happened was he was at 96th Street on the platform, and this woman is just standing there reading the paper, and she's reading an article about him. And he goes up to the woman, and he just points his finger right in the paper and goes, you see this shit they're writing about me? It's not true, and like swats the paper out of her hand. So she obviously knows who he is. She hightails it upstairs, calls the police, says, this guy's in the subway system. So now that all the cops are descending down there, that's why the two cops that were in my car were on the train looking for him. And
were they young cops?
No. One, the male cop was actually bigger than I was, and the female cop was, I guess, average size, whatever.
That's why she didn't run out. That's what you want when they're...
Yeah, so, no, they were, like I said, the male cop's bigger than me, and I knew that they were... It's like you see on TV, where you sign in or whatever roll call, and they say, this is the guy we're looking for. Because when I got to the hospital, I was lying there, and they're cutting off my clothes and everything just to make sure I wasn't wounded anywhere else. And a cop comes around to the table by my head, and he holds up a mugshot that they showed at the precincts that morning. And he said, is this the guy that did this to you? And I said, yeah. And he says, well, you're a hero. And I said, I'm not a hero. Why am I a hero? And he goes, well, he killed 4 people last night. And that was the first...
Heard of it.
That's the first I heard of it. I had no idea.
What was the police explanation as to why they sat in the fucking car while you were being stabbed and they have guns?
Well, if you read the newspapers, the official police stance is that they tackled him. And and not only did the two cops on the train tackle him, an off-duty cop also tackled him. If you listen to the official statements by the police, I'm just the victim. I didn't do anything. They came in and rescued me.
Why? And who's backing him? The police union, right?
I don't know.
So you held him down, and then the cops came and took him?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So you got him a point. The knife was away from him.
Yep.
You had him on the ground.
He dropped the knife when I caught his wrist and slammed it down to the ground.
Do you think if you had recognized who he was, you would have been a little bit more intimidated and maybe not been able to take him down, thinking, oh, this is that killer?
It's always possible. It's the kind of thing where, you know, when everything first happened to me, you know, you guys know this better than anyone. You read what people write on the internet, and I've seen people make comments, oh, yeah, if that was me, I would have done the same thing. And, honestly, you don't know that until you're in that position. So yeah. I don't know how I would have reacted. I would like to think that I would have maybe done something sooner before he attacked me. Maybe when he turned around to walk away, maybe try to get behind him and take him down before he hurt anybody. But honest, I can't answer that honestly because I don't know.
And I would have hightailed it to the second car, by the way, for the record. I'm talking shit, but I would have hightailed it until you were and he was secure. Then I would have run over and kicked the knife away.
Well, obviously we got to get this guy an Opie and Anthony T-shirt.
Jim, to answer your question,
I think it's only fair. I think we'll even sign one for you.
Ooh.
This guy needs a T-shirt, Sam.
And I didn't actually feel any pain. See, the other thing that with this case is I sat on that train bleeding for about 20 minutes. The train was stopped in the tunnel. They didn't get the train going again because they said the police were on the tracks. So I'm basically sitting there bleeding to death. And
in between stops?
In between.
Oh, how scary is that?
Right. So I'm basically screaming, begging the police, you guys have to get me off this train. I have two young kids. I have a wife, you know. You got to get me off this train. And I'm like, why aren't we moving? Why aren't we moving? And at one point, right when we got to 42nd, I blacked out. And I blacked out with my eyes open. And one thing I heard them say was they termed me likely. And I didn't know what that meant. And my sister is a cop. So I asked her what that meant. And it means likely to die. Mm. Okay. And then when I woke up is when I felt the pain. Then I felt like someone doused my head with gasoline and just lit it on fire. I mean, I can't even describe the pain. It was unbelievable. Yeah. But I had enough adrenaline going before I passed out where I didn't feel anything. And then when I woke up, it was just like I've never felt.
You obviously got the scars, but do you have injuries still? Nerve damage? Or
I think I have. There's probably some nerve damage to my thumb. Like I said, he cut me to the tendon, and I still get pins and needles. Even lifting something like a half gallon of milk is difficult.
Right.
You know, it's more psychological than anything. You know, I can't tell you the last day I didn't wake up with a headache. I have headaches all the time. I have anxiety. I have things like that. But, you know, I try to put that all past me because I have a family.
And it beats the option.
Yes.
Which was you being number five.
Yes, exactly. And that was my thought process is when I'm on the train, I wasn't thinking I'm going to be number five because I didn't know about it. I'm thinking if he's going to kill me, I'm going down with a fight.
And Dana White's a big fan, huh?
Yeah.
Big fan of your story, I should say.
He, you know what? The ironic thing is he was in New York the Monday after.
Right.
And the way the story goes is I got a call from Channel 5, or a text from Channel 5 saying that Dana White wants to meet you. And I figured, all right, it would be somewhere down the road. He's probably in Vegas or whatever. And then he goes, well, he's in New York today. He wants to bring you over to meet him and everything. And you know, he was interested in your story because apparently what was happening was they were in a big meeting that day, all the UFC people, and their phone started blowing up because I was doing all the TV interviews saying, you know, I just watch UFC. I've been a fan since UFC 1.
Oh, okay.
And that's how they had heard about it because every time, you know, it was brought up to me, do you fight? Do you train? And I would say, no, but the extent of my training is ordering pay-per-views, you know, pushing order on the remote. And, you know, I've just been a fan since the first one, and I watch all of them religiously, and he heard that, and he jumped all over it.
Wow. Jesus.
That's cool, because we've met. I knew you were sitting. I didn't realize this was your first time here.
Yeah,
I've seen you so many times at events. We always talk.
I said hi and all. I didn't know the story.
I thought he'd been here before, and you know me. He was just a regular coming in.
And just the hanger
But that's
on.
Why I look familiar. No. I remember it from TV.
And I'm like, wait a minute, did Joe ever even get introduced?
I don't know. No.
I'm glad
I
thought of that.
No. Actually, I shouldn't say that. We did meet once when I worked at Madison Square Garden. You guys came to a show to see Ricky Gervais, and I actually gave you your tickets.
Oh, right, the Paramount. Right?
Yes, yeah. So,
oh, no kidding.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, so we did meet once, and Jim, you look miserable going in. So.
Did I really?
Yeah, you look so unhappy.
I did enjoy Ricky that
now
night,
you,
though.
Now you understand what we go through.
Yeah. No, it was just funny because you were fine, and I didn't know you,
happy
obviously,
go lucky,
at the time. Yeah.
Why do you think you were
You just came to the window and just had a puss on. You know, like what you'd expect from how you describe yourself. But yeah.
Why was I unhappy? Because I was going to watch a comedy show with 5,000 people that I was having nothing to do with.
Right, and you were doing bad.
It's like going to a porno shoot with a mop.
Well, I don't think the T-shirt's going to fit, but...
do you got a medium for Joe?
I think he deserves an Opie and Anthony T-shirt.
Can I also give him a copy of Mr. P?
Mr. P on iTunes.
Awesome. That would be great.
On sale now on iTunes. I actually tried to order it again yesterday, but they said I've already downloaded it.
You're welcome.
You can't download it twice?
I don't think you can, or maybe you can, but it just told me and I didn't hit the right button.
Yeah.
I tried to from my phone.
Yeah, we should get out of here, man. Wow, man.
Yeah.
That's a hell of a fucking story right there. Holy shit.
Yeah, you'll see me in the paper next week, actually. I get to see Gelman again. He's being sentenced. He's going to get 25 years next Wednesday.
Oh, why only 25 years? Well, he killed four people.
No, he got 200 years for that.
Oh.
He's already been sentenced in the Brooklyn stuff. I'm the only one in Manhattan.
Oh.
So next Wednesday...
So he's going to get 25 for what he did to you.
25 for what he did to me, and I actually get to go and make a statement, so I'm really pumped.
Could you do us a favor, wear the Opie and Anthony shirt at the...
Yeah, hey, listen, could you plug my gig when you're making the statement? I'm going to be at Caroline's at the end of March.
Yeah, just write everything down. I'll plug Atlanta.
Just the Caroline's in New York.
When you come out on the steps afterwards, go, look, I'm just glad he's in prison. Yeah. By the way, Jim Norton's at Caroline's this weekend. I'm going to go see him. I'm on my way to Caroline's right now because Jim's there the whole weekend.
If anyone has any dates, let me know.
You're grateful. You're grateful to be alive because of your family, but more importantly, because you can see Jim Norton at Caroline's this weekend.
Yeah.
That's how we're going to word it.
Jim Norton and Kenny treat me great, so I'll be more than happy to plug whatever.
Has he communicated with you at all or apologize for it?
Oh, Gelman?
Yeah.
No, the last thing he's ever said was when he was leaving the court in Brooklyn, he told the judge to suck his Russian dick. So he's not one. I don't think him and I are going to be breaking bread anytime
soon. He's a sociopath.
He's something else. I don't know exactly what
him?
He is, but I pretty much hate him. I'm not a big
fan
of
the police.
Some
people would say you got to get over that hate.
No, you know what?
I don't understand those people, but there are people like that. You got to get over that hate.
You know what? Every day I think of them because I get on the subway every day to go to work, and I look at my face every day, and I see scars. So, you know, I've had friends tell me that I need to get over it, but I think it's kind of healthy.
And scars aren't just physical. Yeah. Scars are mental.
Why aren't you on you should be on fucking I Survived.
Steve Wilco or something.
Oh. No, I survived.
I don't know. I was on New York 8, but...
I was thinking more Dancing with the
Sam.
Stars would be cool for you.
Sam laughed. Thank you.
The scar doesn't look bad.
This one
I know it's easy for me to say, but...
You want to see the one in the back?
Yeah, I
want
to see
That's a scar from stopping a murderer. That's a cool scar to show a girl, even if you're married, but...
Definitely.
Yeah, she won't let me out.
Let me see it.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my God. Well, damn.
Oh, that's unsightly. No, I'm just kidding. That looks really cool.
I'm going to be pissed.
This is the
that
one.
On your thumb.
On the
Jesus,
thumb.
I'm not gonna show
Thanks, Sam.
Thumb
scar. Yeah.
And then you got that one up there. I'm in Bragg's. So,
wow.
Yeah.
Jesus, dude.
I've been bragging about a thumb scar for the last 25 years that I...
she got orange, fucking putting butter on a fucking English muffin.
Yeah, it was an orange juice. It was an orange juice lid.
Oh, gotcha, huh?
Oh, I've been talking about this
That's
scar
so
forever.
Manly.
Fuck that. I'm done.
Gotcha.
Done talking
my
about
tummy
my...
tuck scar got your thumb scar.
Let's all just get naked and show our scars off. You got one, Jim?
I got a little burn on my finger from throwing firewood in my fireplace.
And I bet you've mentioned a million fucking... Oh, that's a new one.
Wow. Yes, but it's going
to
go away.
Dude, man, I don't know what to say. Holy fuck.
No, it's cool, man. You know, look, it was real traumatic and everything, and... you know, I live it every day, but I try not to let him take up too much space in my head.
But you got to look at the positive.
Hey, I'm here.
You got to meet us.
Hey, this is great.
Yeah, forget the family, forget Dana, the UFC, this.
It led you to this day where you get to meet us.
Honest to God, this is the truth. When we went to UFC 128 and we were walking down the seats that Dana was so nice to give us,
right?
And I saw Jim. I grabbed my wife and I'm like, holy shit, it's Norton. It's Norton. I got to go meet him. I got to go get a picture. That's a God's honest truth.
Yeah. I obviously a joke, but there was a picture in the paper of the cop that was shot on the job.
Yeah.
And his daughters were at the Super Bowl meeting Madonna. And you wrap your head around that. Like, they're meeting Madonna, which they must be out of their minds, like, how cool this is. But the reason they get to meet Madonna is so fucked up.
So horrible, right?
And it's hard to, like, understand that. You know what I mean? Because you know they're excited.
With a mixture of emotion.
That's what I'm saying.
At being in this great place and meeting somebody you really enjoy, like, you know, at the Super Bowl, and yet...
And then they got to go, oh, yeah, the reason we're meeting Madonna is because some animal killed our father.
Right.
You know? Fucked up.
L-A-U-Z-O-N is you, right?
No, that's the fighter, Lozon.
Wait, you're on Twitter?
I'm on Twitter.
God damn, I got to follow you.
What's your Twitter?
It's at @Joe_Lozito. L-O-Z-I-T-O.
Oh, Lozito. I'm Lozito. Sorry. I called you Lozon. I apologize.
No, it's okay.
I don't follow underscore people, though. I'll make an exception.
I'm going to make an exception.
I appreciate that. And honestly, I'm really happy to be here because one thing I said I've always, you know, that I always try to appreciate everything, but ever since it happened, I don't take any day for granted. And I always want to tell people that I admire how, you know, what they've done for me. And like, I think like you guys are awesome comics, and you know, you and Ant, I mean, I've been listening forever, and you know, you guys are the best at what you do. And to me, to be able to tell you that, I appreciate that. You know, I tell, you know, any athlete I like or musicians, whatever, if I had the chance to tell them, look what you do. Like I always say, if I met Jerry Cantrell, I'd love to tell him, because in the last year, I Alice in Chains, my favorite band, so I've been talking about him before, I loved it. I'd love to tell Jerry Cantrell, man, thank you for your gift, because plenty of days I just put my headphones on and just listened to Alice in Chains and just, you know, lost myself in everything.
What's your song by them?
My favorite song's Angry Chair.
Oh, I like that one. We should play some Angry Chair out.
By the way, you know what I said to Jerry?
It's a great acoustic thing to listen to.
Everything they do, to me, every song they've done is amazing. So, you know, I'm happy that they're, you know, even though, you know, Lane's gone, I'm happy that they're back and making music, because I think they're too talented not to.
Do you know that Jerry Cantrell, we met, and he's like, hey, man, he liked my stuff, and we traded numbers, and he was here in New York. And I picked him up to take him to the Comedy Cellar from his hotel. But I wanted to stop and pick up a celebrity picture that I was having autographed the next day here. And so fucking Jerry Cantrell had to go with me to do golf photo and stand in line.
Really?
And stand in line while I got some fucking, like, a, you know, I don't even remember who it was. Some fucking.
Did that really happen?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Wow. He didn't know what I was getting, and then he came to the cellar with me.
That's funny.
Little known fact about Jerry Cantrell, he was in Jerry Maguire. He was the guy that worked in Kinko's when Cruz went in there to get his memo.
Oh, right, right, right.
He was that really? Long-haired guy behind the counter.
No shit.
A little trivia.
I like it. Let's should get out of
let's
here.
Let's get everybody plug out. We have
Reed still?
That's what I'm trying to tell you.
Oh, fuck.
Let's get all the plugs out. First and foremost, Mr. P is on sale, as you know. iTunes, Amazon.com. You can get it now. It's brilliant. Jim Show, he is doing two shows Friday. One show Friday, one show Saturday. And then the following weekend, it's called I'm Your Savior. It's the Producers Club, 44th Street here in New York. JimFlorentine.com for tickets.
Can I also tell you, it's next month, but I might not be able to come back. I'm actually headlining Industry Night at the Bitter End.
Okay.
So you guys could come see me there. That's March 27th. I just want to...
Yeah, we'll definitely mention that as it gets closer, of course.
Great, thanks.
Awesome.
And I am I'm at the Punchline February 16th through 18th. And Caroline's here in New York, March 29th through April 1. Show up so I'm not humiliated. Thank you. Oh, in the Boneyard tonight, Florentine... And
oh, yeah,
the Zach Roast is playing at 10 o'clock.
Nice.
All the audio from the Zach Wild Roast.
Florentine.
And thank you, everyone, for making Mr. P such a big deal this week. You know, we were ahead of Madonna.
I know, that's great. Big. Especially after she just did the Super Bowl.
Yeah, yeah.
I downloaded it. I'm also getting a physical copy. There's a record store that's bringing it in. Jersey Vintage
really?
Final. So, yeah, I want the physical copy,
oh,
too.
Oh, I have one for you.
No, I got to buy. I got to support.
Wait, you can buy one, but I'll give you one, too.
All right.
I'll take it.
Yes. I got a cop sent to me, and I'm going to sell it. I want all free shit. I don't pay for anything.
Yeah. We're good with free shit. And Florentine's one-man show. Did we get that
coming,
out?
Right? Yeah,
I hope so.
I'm coming next week.
Yeah.
Really? What?
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 What you said, really?
Yeah, what does that mean?
What does that mean, Sam?
I want to see the show.
What?
I mean, it's just like you. Like,
really?
I just said really.
I know, but like you're gonna change
I'm sexy
your plan.
And I know
exactly.
Wiggle, wiggle, wiggle.
All right, say hi to your daughter too.
I will.
And happy
thank
birthday
you so much.
To her.
Happy birthday, Mimi.
Teenager, have fun with that. Holy crap! You're
oh,
in trouble.
Ugh.
You are in trouble.
Ugh.
And you know what? After the read, Sam has nothing planned for his show.
I never do.
Oh, actually, I'll stay with you, Sam. You had a question about this video. If you ask me the question now, can I answer
it?
Now
we'll have to watch the whole thing. Yeah, we have to watch it. It's a 7-minute video.
Yeah.
It's too complicated. All I will say is white guy got caught.
Yeah.
Well, I will have to watch it tomorrow, I think.
So it's Joe_Lozito. You're getting followers. Lozito.
Yes.
I'm following.
You.
Fuck
I
that.
I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Just make sure not every tweet's a downer.
No, man, I'm cool.
Fucking with that.
One of the greatest tweets during the Super Bowl. Yeah. Some guy tweeted at both of you guys, Opie Radio and
same
Jim
time.
Norton. Yeah, he said, hey, dude, you guys complain about anything. Is there anything positive?
Right. And Jimmy's response was great.
That was awesome.
Hope your
great
next blood test.
Yeah. That guy really annoyed me with his positivity.
And
fucking,
I laughed the whole night.
You know because that tweet you were trending in New York.
Really?
Because I think so many people fucking retweeted that thing.
Yeah,
I meant to tell you, I forgot. I was checking out some trending topics, and all of a sudden Norton popped up. Fuck.
Yeah, people got a little.
And then Voss got upset. Yeah.
Why did Voss get upset?
Because you were trending, and he's like, "How can you make me trending?" I said, "Say something smart and funny."
Oh, that's funny. Yeah.
We got to go, Vaughn. Thanks for stopping by, Joe. Thank you, Jim 14. Thank you.
You read that thing before you end the show.
Valentine's Day is Tuesday. If you're like thousands of other men around the country, we have to read Valentine's Day in front of Vaughn. That's awkward, Sam.
Well, why? She knows it's happening. You want her to do it? I didn't pick the calendar. That's awkward.
Well, how about you like casually go with thanks, Vaughn, and you know,
she's
lead her out, and then we do the Valentine's Day.
She knows the holidays here.
Well, yeah, I got to get through every.
All right.
Every day, so.
If you're like thousands of other men around the country, you still haven't bought anything for that special person in your life. Lucky for you, that's the reason Pajamagram is in business. Pajamagram specializes in gifts just for her, like the wildly popular Hoodie Footy pajamas. Jim Norton tried one of those on. That was the thing you tried on, the Hoodie Footy, Jimmy.
And let's just say,
I'm going to retweet that video today.
It did me justice. There's nothing like a gentleman in a Hoodie Footy.
Yeah.
Even though I think they're for women, I put it on and I liked how it looked and felt.
Yeah.
So buy it for your girlfriend and then throw it on when she's not around. It feels right.
Very good. I'll be tweeting that video of Jimmy in it. It's a great one. He looks great in it a little later today. If you're looking for something that shows a bit more skin, you could choose from Pajamagram's collection of sexy pajamas. Better yet, get her the best of both worlds with a sweet and sexy gift set. This includes a warm and comfortable Hoodie Footy along with something sexy like the Midnight Fantasy short set. Buy a sweet and sexy set today and save $50. Order today and Pajamagram will guarantee that she gets it in time for Valentine's Day. Pajamagram has lots of pajamas that are perfect for Valentine's Day. Every Pajamagram is delivered in free gift packaging. Tuesday, Valentine's Day. Deliver, guaranteed, but you got to get on this. Visit pajamagram.com or call 1-800-GIVE-PJs.
Yeah, this is the Opie and Anthony Show. SiriusXM.
Hey, hey, hey!
And now, the Opie and Anthony Show continues. This is After O&A Live. Here's your host, Sam Roberts.
Hey, while we still have time, guys hate Valentine's Day. You know that, Who Kid?
I know, I got two bitches.
They really hate it. There's so much pressure on them to get the perfect gift for their wife or girlfriend. It's all been done before, but you can get her a gift that you'll get credit for all year long. Steven Singer has the perfect gift for Valentine's Day just for you. A real long stem rose dipped in 24 karat pure gold. You would love
wow,
that. Get a rose, but it's dipped in gold. Just go online to IHateStevenSinger.com. Pick the traditional Valentine's Day red rose or one of his other premium colors. Then, choose your very own personalized message of love for the included card. Order now, and shipping is still free. That's right. There's still time to order. Get free shipping and receive it before Valentine's Day.
Wow.
You're going to get a real rose dipped in 24-karat pure gold, enclosed in a beautiful gift box, shipped for free, and they're guaranteed to last forever. Listen up. Here's where the more important part comes in. You're going to want a certain color, and they're going to sell out. The green apple rose is already gone, so order it now and be done with it. Steven's making your Valentine's Day shopping so easy. Get your gold dip rose today. It's only $69. This is the number one Valentine's Day gift. Call him now, 888-I-HATE-STEVEN-SINGER, or go online to IHateStevenSinger.com.
I won't be getting shit for Valentine's Day.
That's, maybe somebody could order Vaughn a nice gold dip rose or something.
It's not dipped in chocolate, though?
No, rose?
Look at him. He's trying to get himself in there.
By the way, I'm going to say this. Vaughn, you're still here. Who Kid is still here. I don't know how many tweets, text messages from people I know who listen that I got last time you two were on the after show together from people.
Yeah,
people,
I got a lot, too.
People loved Patrice so much, like even our awful fans just have love for him, and they're protective over you.
Okay.
Oh.
Because you're Patrice's wife. They're all
I thought they were just saying they like the dynamic of the three of us.
Do you know how many people tweeted me or texted me saying, "Look, Sam, show was great. Don't let Who Kid fuck Vaughn."
Oh, wait. Because
Who Kid was flirting with her the whole time.
Bro.
And everybody was made to feel... People felt uncomfortable because they felt, no, no, no.
There's nothing wrong with my dick being in her pocket temporarily.
First of all, let's
this
not...
Is what I'm talking about.
Not that I'm saying that I'm going to fuck Who Kid, but let's not cock block. I am alone. And I'm certainly not ready to be with anyone as of yet that I know of in my head. I'm in a very confused state right now.
Yeah.
But at the same time, actually, that just made me think of the last time I was here, too. And he was interviewing Terrence Howard.
Yeah.
I saw the interview afterwards when they started talking about me when I walked by.
That's so funny.
Two things happened. One, I'm not Spanish. No. I'm black. Black and white. And two...
Who said you were Spanish?
Terrence Howard.
Terrence did.
Yeah. Two, he looked down at my ring and goes, she's married.
Yeah.
And I was like, guys, look at that. So I still have my rings on.
Yeah.
I am not, like, out there. But at the same time, I have to... I'm starting to realize that, yes, I am single now, and I don't know what that means after 10 years of Patrice.
It's very strange.
It's very strange, but don't be cock-blocking fans, because be straight. Patrice would have had a Brazilian hooker at my funeral if it was the other way around.
He would have had a woman on his arm.
He would have had the bitch at the funeral, like, I'm distraught. You're going to have to suck my dick as soon as we get home.
It's so innocent. Yo, all you got to do, Sam, innocent. You just take your dick out and put it in her pocket.
Just put it in the pocket.
That's it. She leaves with it. She comes back.
I mean, before we got on the air, Hootkid was leaning over to the computer, and she was like, do you want me to switch seats so you could use this? And
Hootkid
was
like,
he said so nonchalantly, no, I'm trying to look up your dress. He just went back to the computer.
No panties. Happy Valentine's Day.
Well, I'm on my period, so.
Oh, my God.
You're going to see panties, and they're going to be like...
strawberry sauce.
Dipped in other things.
This show lasted 2 minutes, and it was already very revealing, but that's it. Now the show's over.
Like, oh, my God.
So plug your Twitters.
At Vondecarlo.
Vondecarlo.
At DJ Hookah. This is the fastest show ever.
That's it. It's very fast moving. It feels like it barely happened at all.
Can I get my dick back?
Stay tuned.
I'll hold it for a while.
Stay tuned. And don't let me hear shit about that, because you heard these are Von's wishes. Stay tuned. Ron and Fez are coming up next. Goodbye.
Anthony Show is now over. For real this time. Check out the ONA Show on Facebook at facebook.com/Opie and Anthony. And catch Opie and Anthony live Monday through Friday from 6 to 10 a.m. Eastern. Ron and Fez are next.
Hey.